Yes, welcome to the BBC, and this is a download from BBC Six Music. We're taking you into the realms of the podcast, so to find out more, go to bbc.co.uk/sixmusic. Yeah.
Yeah, welcome to the podcast. This is the actual podcast now. Yeah.
Trevor, you got me near the mic.
Sorry, we're rolling, yes.
Right, thanks for downloading our podcast. Even Chris Moyles himself has recommended it now, hasn't he? What did he say, Trev?
Yeah,
don't say the bit about him not used to liking me, but liking me now.
Okay, he didn't not used to like you, he's always liked you.
Consistently liked me. Good old Moylesy!
Even when he was born, he liked you, and you weren't even born at that point.
That is a premonition that he must have had.
Yeah.
Who else has been recommending us lately? Someone else, wasn't it?
Oh, Jonathan Ross.
Jonathan Ross. I was on Joe Wiley the other day, she likes me. A lot of BBC Radio talent. Matt, why have you got this expression of cynicism etched across your angry brow?
They like me, they like me, they like me, as if you're an abstract concept. You are you.
I am me! Look at my body!
Oh, up
you should get out in the sun, and, mate.
Do I look pale?
Yeah, really
pale.
Yeah, I do look like a corpse.
You want to watch that, though? That would get
I've got two moles.
That's more worrying for me, that mark there.
That lesion.
Is that a lesion?
Don't examine my corpse. I'm not a cadaver. You're not medical students. This ain't Victorian days. I ain't Frankenstein.
This is going to be an intro to a podcast.
All right, welcome. Thanks for the podcast. Listen to it now.
Thanks for the podcast. You did it.
Yeah, thanks. Bye. Love you.
BBC Six Music.
That was Echo and the Bunnymen. This is Six Music. I'm Russell Brand. We're in, guess what? It's a really good atmosphere. I think it's going to be a really good show. I'm here with Matt Morgan. He's in charge of the buttons. Yo, Matt!
Hey, Russ.
Why are you so downbeat? What's wrong with you?
I've just, you know.
What, you think that I'm being like a cliche DJ?
Yo, Matt. How am I
just being upbeat, Matt? Is that a crime? Sorry, I tell you what, let's go through life all dour, hating everything and being all cynical so that your friends have to build a cultural review into their radio show so that you have some contact with life. Trevor Locke's here. He's in charge of competitions and phone calls. Cocky Locky, you all right, mate?
Good morning. Good Sunday morning.
You stayed at my house last night, didn't you?
Yes, I did.
Yeah. Trevor Locke slept on my settee. Did you like it?
It was a very comfortable settee, yeah.
It's nice. Did you sleep well?
Not that well, no. There was a few interruptions.
What seems to be the trouble, Doctor?
Well, there was some noise coming from another room. There was a cat that...
My cat, Morrissey?
Yeah. He slept on my bed.
Did he?
Well, not my bed, it's a sofa and it's yours.
It's funny, Trev, how you suddenly take control of things and claim to own things. Was that your phone going off, Trev?
Yes, it was.
What's wrong with you?
I've turned mine off.
It's really unprofessional.
Functioning.
Anything else happened with Trevor with those Italian girls, the teenage girls, aged 17, that you've got inappropriately and, in my view, illegally living in your house?
Well, they brought a young man home the other day and walked in...
Probably just trying to have a natural childhood, Trev. Don't begrudge them that.
He walked into the bathroom and saw my dinkle.
Oh, my God. Why? Why would you even leave it in there? You should keep it with you all times, Trev. I mean, I know you don't use it often.
It was my spare one. I was washing it.
I tell you what, if I were you, I'd make the switch now, start using that one straight away, because the one you've got's a bloody nuisance. Matt Morgan! We'll be doing your culture review a bit later, won't we?
I'm sulking after you introduced it like that.
Why?
Why don't we build a bit of the show? You're miserable. Yeah.
Oh, don't feel attacked, Matt. I just said that really. For a bit of a laugh. So what we're talking about today, love. We're talking about love
first
and everything.
Love.
Ah, love, eh? I mean, it just dwarfs everything, doesn't it, eh? Love? Once you, sometimes you get all, I mean, I'm just talking from a personal perspective, you might get all, like, I don't know, vain, egotistical, obsessed by your own self, you know, and then you think, oh, love, that's bigger than all that, ain't it?
Yeah, I think it's dangerous and should be held at arm's length.
I suppose so. What do you think, in sort of an Aldous Huxley-style future world, love would be outlawed for being dangerous?
No.
Or like in Clockwork Orange. It might
really
be.
Silly.
What about in Clockwork Orange? No one loves each other there, do they? Oh, except that writer and his wife, they love each other, but look what happened to them two. Them lads turned up round, all dressed up in masks.
And terrible business.
Behaved awfully towards them. Trev, what's the story of your first love?
Well, it's very...
I'm sure it is unpleasant, particularly for the poor lady or man involved in it, or perhaps or whichever pet it was that you set about.
No, it was a young lady. I didn't fall in love with anything else. It was, her name was Jo.
Yeah.
And I took her to see Romeo and Juliet.
Clichéd.
Very clichéd.
How old were you?
18, 17.
What had you been doing up until then, Trev?
Why had you had no love till then?
I reckon he was falling in love with finger puppets until that day.
Well, yeah, but I was embarrassed about falling in love. I was really embarrassed about falling. If I liked a girl, I was sort of very humiliated by it.
It's probably, Trev, because you spent your entire school years with a paper dragon on your hand called Ricky.
No, that was only about 3 months.
And well, what about all the animal killing as well that you indulged in as a child?
About that, and that's been exaggerated for comic effect, and it's probably run its course now.
I don't think it has run its course, Trevor. A lot of people think that animal cruelty is right up there, quite high up on the agenda. It's nice you trying to dwarf it. If I had something to be that deeply ashamed of, I'd try and belittle it as well. You can't minimise stuff like that, Trevor.
Animal cruelty is overrated.
Rhymey. Right. I hope the Animal Liberation Front are listening to this radio show.
Yeah, so do I.
You announced your address last week, or your phone number on the podcast last week. Let's have your address this time. You should have seen Matt Morgan then do a cough behind his head. Like, oh, I'm on radio. I'll do a cough like an old lady coughing into her handbag on a bus. Oh, I'll keep this cough in here for later. It can come for me now my dickie's gone.
Why are you touching yourself when you get excited?
I think it might be because...
He gets excited by an idea. He gets all on a run and he touches himself.
I eroticise entertainment, that's why. I'm an erotic kind of guy. Now? Just fancied it. I felt like the used two were bunching up against
you
me.
Know, before. You're not allowed to stand on that thing because it echoes.
Oh, God.
For the benefit of the listeners...
It's like a bat cave.
Russell doesn't have a normal microphone like most DJs. He gets an own microphone shipped in every Sunday morning. He stands like a rock star.
I might pull down my trousers and pants. Oh, now Matt's coughing down his jumper. What's wrong with you?
I'm trying not to cough on the radio. I'm professional. Unlike you, who eats fruit down the mic.
You're like...
Sounds like someone trudging around on a farm.
You're coughing, coughing away like Charlie Cotton. Trying to do a radio show with Charlie
I've
Cotton.
Got hair in my throat.
Guys, it's love this morning.
All right, we're talking about love. So if you've got any stories about love, I'll give you the address in a minute. Also, later on, there's going to be Matt's cultural review. Trevor's Sonic Enigma. That'll be a laugh. Noel Gallagher reckons he's coming in here. We've got Lisa Morris, she's going to pop down, Kimberly Stewart, all sorts of people. Trevor's got some woman who's coming in here to sell us cookies, ain't you, Trev?
Yes.
Mr. G will be doing a poem. We've got loads of stuff, but first of all, we're going to be talking about love. Also, me, Matt and Trev went and had tubes fed up inside our anuses yesterday and all of our poo pumped out. And colonic irrigation, I think, Colonic hydrotherapy. We're going to be telling you all about that and our different reactions to it. Obviously, I took it like a gentleman. Trevor treated it like a girlfriend. Let's listen to Jackie Wilson. If you want to tell us about your first love or any kind of love, text us on 64046 or email me at russell.6music@bbc.co.uk. Also, guess who's number two in the podcast charts? iTunes podcast, diddly iTunes charts. Us, that's who. Yes, that's right. Are you proud, Matt, to be number two in the podcast chart?
Very proud, but it's made me hungry for one.
Hungry for one. We've got to get to number one and we're going to do something bizarre and exciting when that day eventually comes, aren't we, Trev?
We are. We're going to do an absolute... extraordinary thing.
We were thinking of having a banquet on a roundabout.
A banquet?
On a roundabout with homeless people.
Come up with some ideas to help
us. Up with some ideas if you want. We can't promise we'll do them, but we're going to do something extraordinary when we get to number one in the podcast charts. Assuming that we do. We're going to just push on.
It's an assumption.
It's an assumption, but it's
a dangerous assumption.
It's a dangerous one, but isn't that what made Britain great? No, dangerous assumptions, colonialism and oppression and war. Isn't that what made Britain great? Text us 64046, email russell.6music@bbc.co.uk. Your love is affecting me in a way that I can only describe as positive, you know, in an altitude sense. Jackie Wilson. It's difficult not to feel upbeat after listening to Jackie Wilson singing that. This is Russell Brand on 6 Music. I'm here with Matt Morgan and Trevor Lott. We're talking about love. What are you on about love then, Matt, that makes you feel ill or something?
Makes you feel depressed. Like thinking
love makes you feel depressed.
Well, at the moment, because I'm not in love, it's like Christmas. When it's not Christmas and you hear a carol,
seems inappropriate.
So that song, you think, oh, this was written when someone was in love. There was some love out there.
There must be genuine love in that song, wasn't there, I suppose? Whoever wrote that must have, when they wrote it, must have been, that's got genuine love in it. That's got something offensive.
You hope it's not some cynical guy with a pen behind his ears chugging on a fag going, yeah, this is a good chord progression.
Trevor, if it was that guy, I imagine his songwriting would be interrupted by you pulling down his trousers and pants and sexually invigorating him.
Well, if that's how you want to play it, yeah.
Yeah, that is how I perceive you, Trev. As a person who literally sucks up to the man.
A muse for Motown.
A muse for Motown. A sexual muse for Motown.
Yeah.
I think you could do it, Trev.
I think
you've got
records.
It in you. Right, we've got some interesting, like, we've been talking about love on our thing, the 6 Music message board. How do people look at that, Trev?
How do they look at that?
I use their eyes and their computers, but I mean, there's probably some technical information.
You know, disappointing and sordid little festival of nastiness, really.
You think that's their perspective? Yeah. You think they regard it as a festival of nastiness?
Yeah, I think
that's how I regard your sex life, Trevor. Okay. A carnival of cruelty, a Mardi Gras of malcontent that takes place.
At least it's only once every 4 years, though, eh?
But not too shabby recently.
Trevor had it off on Thursday with a girl. Now he's got embarrassed about it. Trevor had it off on Thursday with a girl. He threw his headphones on the floor.
Trevor's just thrown his headphones on the floor.
Trevor, you're not Keith Moon. Pick up those headphones at once and be like, this is the BBC. Put that in the podcast.
You're not Cliff Richard either.
No, Trev, you are allowed to have sex. It's not like your sex life is abhorrent.
Are you crying or laughing, Trev?
Well, are you embarrassed about your sex life, Trev? What's her name?
No, let's not do this.
No, because she's embarrassed.
Deeply
what are you embarrassed for? Is she listening? Oh, right, okay, because he's married. He's embarrassed because he's married and it's illegal to have it on when you're married. Yeah, but come on, Trevor, your marriage is absolute farce.
Why have you got yellow stuff on your elbow?
I've sort of...
I reckon it's connected to this sex he's been having. One day he had sex, next day he turns up at work with yellow on his elbow. It's not a coincidence. All right, let's read out some of these mouths while Trevor recomposes himself.
I've
get
got
it together.
Text here.
Go on then, Matthew, read it out, mate.
Trevor, Matt and Russell.
I'm going to do a text now. That's how you come across. Yeah, you coughed.
Yeah, because I've got something in my throat.
This isn't the old days. You're not that Keith Wolverstone.
Stop touching yourself. Let me read this out.
All right, go on then.
Trevor, Matt and Russell. To my eternal shame, my first love was Stu Francis of Crackerjack fame.
I liked him. Hiya, kids. Hiya, Stu. Ooh, I could crush a grape. Ooh, I could wrestle an action man. Ooh, I could jump off a Wendy house, to name but three.
Okay. As I was 8, he was on the telly. It was never really going to come to much. Mm. Listen to this bit. My first true love in real life was last year, and it's a laborious story I won't bore you with.
Brilliant. We're not interested in laborious
stories. It was only last
year,
so she was in love last year. Now it's become a laborious story.
How quickly it turns around.
Exactly, that's my point.
So one minute you're in love, the next minute it's become a laborious story. Probably like Trevor's forthcoming divorce. This is from Rumblebee. I know a guy who first realised he was gay when watching Rent-A-Ghost. Something about Mr. Claypole's tight jester outfit created a stirring. That's from Rumblebee. I liked Mr. Claypole as well.
I liked the fact he had that
little Mr. Claypole thing. Did he blame that for stuff? Did he go, I think little Mr. Claypole might have touched your bottom, Mrs. Popoff?
No, I think that's coming from your own experience.
But hey, listen, little Russell makes a lot of crazy decisions, Matt. I won't have that guy condemned.
Yes, I've seen
He's just
papers.
Making his way through life.
Yeah, no, I used to love Rent-A-Ghost. That it was weird.
You were on about quite a lot. It was pretty weird, yeah.
The neighbours who lived next door.
They were just trying to live their lives.
The Meekers.
The Meekers. Oh, we're upset the Meekers. Why did you even need to rent a ghost for?
Yeah, that was odd, wasn't it?
Didn't even make sense as a concept. Then there's that witch, Missy Sank. She was quite sexy.
Scottish. Wasn't she super grand later in life?
I don't know if she was, but I know that she had she sort of had the twin assets of being an old lady.
But sexy.
And having quite big boobs. Strange, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Rent-A-Ghost.
I used to fancy old lady. I also used to fancy Ruth Madden. That's one of my first loves.
Yeah, I fancied Ruth Madden.
She goes, hello, campers.
Hello there. Oh, Mr. Fairbrothers.
Oh,
she was well sexy. And what about them other three women with their nice legs?
Well, yeah, I fancied them.
It was them three women in the yellow jacket. They were meant to make us feel like that. Spike! Spike! There's a competition, Spike! Dress as a banana! I fancied that
Always
guy.
On.
Spike!
And,
Spike!
And that woman in
Heidi Lowe. Lowe talking about.
Yeah, Heidi High was good.
Yeah.
All these things.
There was not subliminal sex, but subtextual sex. I mean, it wasn't like they were going, right, here is sexual imagery to hook you in prepubescent viewers. But that's how it works, wasn't it?
Yeah, completely. But like Ruth Maddock was sexy, or Maddox.
Yeah, she was. But even though she had short hair, which wasn't customary, you wouldn't fancy that normally.
She had a short skirt and she was well sexy.
Oh, Mr. Fairbrothers. She was rude, wasn't she?
Yeah.
You could tell what she'd do out.
That bird in Hello, Hello, he's went, oh, Rene.
Oh, Rene, Vicky Michelle. Oh, let's get Vicky Michelle on the show, Trev.
Oh, yeah.
You like Vicky Michelle, don't you?
Yeah,
Vicky Michelle was beautiful. How can we ever justify getting her on the show?
I'll think of a way.
Yeah, I know you will, because you're always luring people in. The poor Papini sisters.
It.
The Papini sisters have moved into a shelter for battered women just to get away from Trevor Locke.
The Pipettes have rejected me.
The Pipettes, Trev, have had the good sense to stay out of this studio, which has become known in the pop music industry as Trevor Locke's lair, as his crib of hatred and deviance. We've got another message here from Miss Raquiba. Miss Raquiba, that's a strange bit of language. My first love was Raphael, the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtle. From the film, not the cartoon, this person specifies.
She's not mad.
I didn't know about sex then. I was about 5, so it was all very innocent, though ultimately doomed, as he was A, a mutant, B, fictional, and C, living in New York. They've bothered to, all right, fair enough, I can get over this fictional thing, and I'm not prepared to overlook being a mutant, I'm a forward-thinking person, but, you know, long-distance love affairs, are they ultimately doomed and frustrating? Just ask Cocky Locky there, staring listlessly at his own lap, the seat of so much guilt and hatred, that groin, that cauldron of sex and hatred that is Trevor Locke's ghouly area.
Poor old Trev.
Poor old Cocky Locky.
If you fancy that, how can you fancy one Ninja Turtle when they're all identical?
They're all the same.
Different colours and different weapons.
Trevor, Matthew, because, I tell you why, because of their personalities, Matthew. Some people consider personalities when falling in love. Not like you, seeing sex as a sort of a lineup, like the usual suspects. You wandering along with a riding crop, jabbing people in the abdomen, going, her. I mean, they're all the same, but that one's got a slightly nicer gutty one. I like that one's shins. Her.
And this is nothing like you with your boob obsession.
How dare you, Matt Morgan, when I am the closest thing to Jermaine Greer you're likely ever to get in a man. I couldn't be any more feminist if I had, instead of my delightful dinkle, that other thing that they have that we prize so highly. Trevor, listen to... right, in a minute we're going to listen to the Yeah Yeah Yeahs, but first a little bit of propaganda for a programme that I'm actually in. It's a Rob Brydon programme, but then the Yeah Yeah Yeahs! Turn into the Yeah Yeah Yeahs. Listen to Russell Brand and Six Music. I'm here with...
That's a good song.
Matthew. It's brilliant, isn't it?
I like that song.
It's good, isn't it? Why do you like it?
Because the melody's good.
Good, cause the melody's good.
It is.
Cause I'm a bit like Rain Man. Cause the melody's good. Something not my
rubbish.
These good,
days that you're into.
Oi, I like all sorts of different things, like standing up, sitting down, moving about. Cocky Locky, why are you so despondent for?
I'm not despondent, I'm really happy.
You seem all downbeat about some things.
No.
If you've been exposed.
No.
What's wrong with you?
No, I've just received a disturbing message, that's all on my desk.
Yeah, well, here's another disturbing message. Back your ideas up, Locke. We've all got jobs to do. Here's another, there's something called the message board. This is from Schnoody Wiggler. They got funny names, everyone, on the message
Schnoody
board.
Schnoody Wiggler.
Schnoody Wiggler.
I think they make them up just for the message board.
No.
Well, you know, Trevor is a made-up name at some point. My first crush was on a blonde boy in my class called Kevin. I thought he was lovely, so I wrote him a poem during one poetry lesson. Perfect time to do it, in my view. I was 7, and I'd like to share it with you. Kevin kicks footballs all day. Every day he will say, violence I hate, I'm in love with my date, no footballer will stand in my way. It actually spells Kevin if you read it down, yeah, because the first line starts with Kevin, the next word starts with every day,
and
it's violence. Do you believe she was 7? Because, like, it was clever of her to mimic that that poetic device. We've got a poetry expert, Mr. G's, here.
You can just copy, can't you?
What do you mean, copy?
Well, you've seen another poem where somebody did that with Dave, so you do it with Kevin.
Trevor, why do you
Trevor,
have to diminish everything?
Like,
not diminishing.
The way people get addicted to drugs. Yeah, you see another poem about Dave. You write a poem about Kevin.
Yeah, seen it a
before you
times.
Know it, you've written a haiku on your arm with a compass. Come on, Trev. It actually spells Kevin. I don't know why I remember it, probably because it rhymes. It didn't work. He didn't want to be my boyfriend. But years later, when we left school, in my yearbook, he wrote, I'll always feel that an opportunity slipped through my fingers. That's beautiful, isn't it?
At the age of 7, an opportunity slipped through his fingers.
That's yeah, all sorts were slipping through my fingers when I was 7. Tadpoles, skips, happiest days of my life, they were. So, Trevor, we've got to get a chat. We're doing a challenge for you, Trev. Here's one. Own up to yourself. Be yourself, stop being so afraid of your family. You're not Lady Diana. What's up with you? Why are you living in such dread and terror for? What's the matter with you, Trevor?
Well, you know, it's a difficult subject, isn't it?
What subject is a difficult
subject
one?
Of love. It's very
it's know, very complex,
you know,
love.
I think it's mental illness.
You think love is like love a mental illness?
Well, it is a mental illness, I think.
Have you got any support for that, or are you just going to say something like that?
No.
It's a chemical imbalance trick.
Exactly. It's a chemical imbalance in your brain. You know, it makes you have a distorted view of reality.
You don't want to eat food.
Exactly. After about 12 weeks, it disappears, and then you go back to normal, and you think, what on earth did I ever see?
Hold on. You think true love only has a 12-week shelf life? You don't think it can ever go on longer than that?
Sometimes it can, but usually no. By then, you've made promises that you've you have to keep.
Well, yes, Trevor. Mostly to your family in your case. Trevor's actually doing V signs at me there. Trevor Locke, one of the great Englishmen.
I think you're
acting like a yobbo.
You can be in love your whole life with someone.
Why are you saying that over there to him and not saying it to me?
Because I'm addressing it to him, because he just he said you've got 12 weeks.
You have got 12 weeks. To be in love, you've got 12 weeks. And then after that, you've made promises that you keep for the rest of your life.
But yeah, it's ridiculous.
The love bit, the tingly bit, the breathless bit where you can't eat, where you get palpitations, butterflies in your stomach and all that. Mm. That only can last for a maximum of 3 months.
Yeah, but then it might come back.
Trevor tries to recreate that rush, killing and torturing. Trevor, let's talk about your challenge. Get a piercer from Camden or somewhere to have a numbered list of Trevor's body parts and some dice, and then just puncture things up and down his body. That's a lovely suggestion.
It's not.
Luke's got some suggestions. As Luke's usual. Become, it's built into the mythology of our programme. If it's not grandiose to describe our programme as having a mythology, it's not ancient Greece. This week's theme is snails, says Luke. Trevor, do one of these challenges or else. Get a snail and get Trevor to eat it live on air. Surely the radio authorities don't have control of what you do to insects or Trevor.
I like snails. I'm happy to eat a snail.
Are
if
you?
Someone brings a snail.
Have you eaten them before in France or something?
Yes, I've eaten them in France. I've eaten them in
decadent.
I don't think you'd want to eat one raw.
No, not raw. No, I'd like to eat them cooked. Yeah.
Well, that's maybe not. May not be an option, Trev. Right. You know. Listen to this. This is number two. Right. You know how you don't eat biscuits like I'd previously assumed. Well, you know how you definitely eat fruit. Stick a whole banana in your mouth, spit it out afterwards. Then, with the mess, chuck it at your next guest on the show unexectedly. Could do that.
Especially if it's Noel Gallagher, that would work.
He'd beat you up.
He wouldn't beat me.
He'd punch you.
I reckon he'd get the banana and sort of scrunch it into your face.
Than me.
Trevor, he has lived the life of fighting and violence.
I'm nimble,
I
know moves.
He is a yob. He is essentially an unreconstructed lout. Loose. I think that he should be made to put down that guitar, take hold of a pickaxe or a shovel, be sent to some subterranean mine and toil in underground sugar caves. Russell, I know your working schedule is really busy, more busy than a poverty-driven child, probably, so it's understandable you don't reply to your MySpace messages. However, Trevor, you have no reason, so Russell should give you a Chinese burn-your-old. Trevor, you're still cruising around on MySpace, posing as a 17-year-old lesbian.
Giving up MySpace now.
Why? No, you've not.
I have.
Trevor, I don't know, how are you luring these people back to your bed if it ain't via MySpace?
Well, it's not. I don't do it.
You do, Trevor.
I don't. It's gone all wrong, MySpace.
Right, let's have a look at MySpace page and see what Trevor's been up to on there, because I think we should keep...
I notice your page has turned sort of brown.
It has, yeah.
Probably because of filth. Okay, I'm not surprised it's turned brown with all the smut flying about.
It's a golden colour.
That's interesting, actually, because your fecal matter was similarly golden.
We'll be
talking about our colonic irrigation
like
a little bit later.
Up there I've got.
Let's talk about colonic irrigation, but first of all, it's a little show we like to call the news. What track have we got coming out of the news? Is it the Smiths? Might be the Smiths coming out of the news. Still ill. Exciting. Still ill, Trevor. What song could be more appropriate to describe a man living a lie? But first, the news.
BBC. Six Music.
Still ill, the Smiths there. You listen to Russell Brand on Six Music. I'm here with Matt Morgan and Trevor Locke. We're just having our photos done. There's a girl in here, Fizz, doing me and Trev's photograph. All of our photographs, right? We're just having a bit of a laugh. Me undoing Trev's shirt and, like,
no,
kissing
looked,
him and
it
that.
Wrong.
So, what's wrong?
Russell
goes, define wrong.
Be in these photos and pinched me.
I did pinch you.
Dragging me across the room.
I just can't be in the photos. Matt wouldn't be in the photographs pretending. He's going, no, I don't like it. It looks gay, right? Which, who cares if things look gay or not? And like, but the reason he gave was it looks gay. The actual reason is because he doesn't think his hair looks nice. Because when he goes, oh, the photographer, he goes, oh, I wish someone had told me. I look like a right gippo. So let's count up the people Matt's offended today. You've offended the travelling. You've offended the travelling community. You've offended homosexuals. Who's next, who's next? Who are you going to attack
now?
I
don't know my name. You've offended me.
I don't know your name. This
you've
is like the bit
me.
In the jazz singer where he rips it. You are not my son. You are not my son. Rip my shirt. That being the jazz singer was a bit overacted. We're talking about love. Love, love. Oh, good old love. Play one of them love jingles, Matt. See what it's like.
Well, they're not set up, so.
Oh, God. You know. We had some love jingles. Their love jingles aren't set up.
You were my first love.
Nice. That works quite
first
well.
Love never.
So, Trev, you never finished your first love story.
So we went to Romeo and Juliet and we drove there in my Austin Allegro through the night to get there. It was misty, it was February, it was Warwickshire.
Sam, it was Warwickshire. That's just where you live.
It's not where I live. I live in Northamptonshire. I had to cross over to the county border. So we get there, we watch
Why?
This.
Because she was underage.
No, because that's where the plays were.
Yeah, better get you out of here, girl. Yeah.
We were, I think she was 18, I was 18, and we went to the Swan to see Shakespeare, Romeo and Juliet. We watched it, and I couldn't say
anything. What, in Stratford?
Yeah. I've been in love with her for a few weeks and I couldn't eat. I wasn't eating properly and I was getting up really early. I wasn't sleeping. It was terrible.
It's almost diabetes. Do you remember when we had that chronic? The woman goes, have you got any? He goes, well, I'm almost diabetic.
Almost. Diabetic is not an achievement, Trevor. You can't swagger through life going, I'm diabetic, I'm asthmatic, I lie about my marital status. These things are not achievements, Trevor.
Where? I am married. Where did these things come from? Where did it, I don't, anyway, stop it. Listen.
Come on in. So this is like, yes, he went to the swan with this girl you're in love with.
I couldn't say anything to her. I couldn't really speak to her properly. We couldn't even hold hands. It was awkward.
Isn't
and then there was people
that
falling in love in front of us on stage and then killing each other.
Where you're crippled when you actually like someone.
Yeah, absolutely. It is, isn't it? Because you can be all really cool and funny when you don't care about someone. Yeah. When you love them, why are you not funny? Where does all the funny go when you're in love?
Oh, it's because you're so vain and you think if you move your little finger, she'll notice it and think, oh, God, why is
probably
it
would notice if you move your little finger. She's probably on tenterhooks the whole time she's with you. You smuggling across county lines in your Austin Allegro so you can perform in what would otherwise be an illegal act.
There just wasn't a Shakespearean theatre in Northampton, that's all. So anyway.
I'm not surprised, Trev. It's a county full of savages. What would be the point?
It would be like doing
Wagner before hillbillies.
Very cultured at 18, wasn't he, Trev?
Trevor was, actually.
Yeah.
Well, Trevor's like that, isn't it? Because he ignored mainstream culture, Matt. While you and I were liking things like Star Wars and glue sniffing, Trevor was off, enjoying, Pirandello. And reading Bukowski.
I wasn't into Pirandello at that age. It was more Lawrence Ferlinghetti. But anyway, but he's not high culture. Well, he's just a beat poet from San Francisco.
Hey, but aren't we all?
Hey, in a crazy way, aren't we all just beat poets from San Francisco? Yeah. Bidibub, bidibub, bidibub.
Johnny Mellon had a patch on his ass. Kids chasing. So anyway,
it ends with you and me, Matt, walking away, establishing our own radio show away from that jerk.
We get back into the car. We have to go home at school the next day, and I'm driving through this mist and it's
keep
dark.
Going on about the mist
and I said
atmosphere.
So I tried to talk to her and I think of all I can remember saying, for some reason I said, do you believe in the devil? And
why do you ask people things like that on a date?
I can't remember, but I think we must have been having some sort of philosophical
discussion. Now,
whether
your marriage collapsed, do you believe in the devil?
In this story, you've mentioned the fog too many times.
Too many mentions of the fog.
The fog is important, as you will find out now. I said to her something like,
do you
believe
in the
devil? And the next thing I know, we've crashed. I've driven into the side of the road because of the fog. I haven't noticed a corner. And what's happened is I've buckled my wheel.
That's better not be a euphemism, Trevor. Better not be.
And
I don't want to see that written on a charge sheet somewhere, wheel buckling on the county borders.
So she was really shaken because I'd mentioned the devil and we crashed at that moment.
So to her it looked like, do you believe in the devil, Harris?
And then slammed into a tree.
Do you ever dance with the devil in the pale moonlight? Take that, you bitch!
Yeah.
Kiss me, you fool!
It was school tomorrow!
it wasn't
Here's
very exciting.
Here's Trevor!
It wasn't a very exciting crash. There were no wheel spins or squeaks. It was just a thud. Buckle the wheel, and then what I had to do is I had to drive home, and the wheel was buckled, and so it made the steering wheel sort of wobble and jerk. And
you should have seen that mime, people listening. You should have seen Trevor Luck miming that steering wheel, wiggling his little body, wiggling his little bum about on the chair, like a dog dragging its ass across a carpet.
It was like having to do an arm wrestle, a double arm wrestle, with a sort of mad, drunken sailor.
Who is this sailor? What is this metaphor? You should have read more of that San Franciscan poetry, Trev, because your understanding of imagery is at best intermediate.
Anyway, eventually we get home. It takes about 3 hours to get home because I'm doing this wrestle with the sailor in the front seat trying to get the car.
Trevor, that sounds like a normal night for you these days, wrestling with a sailor in the front seat, leaving your jeans in a Soho toilet. It's the way you live these days.
I get home and then she didn't call me.
I'm not surprised, Trev.
Of course she didn't.
Do you believe in the devil? Crash. For God's sake. What, Matthew? What should we do?
I don't know.
Years later, though, years later I met her and she said she always fancied me.
Poor girl. What's her name?
Jo.
We'll dedicate a song to this poor girl. Me and my mates used to, this is from Stacey and Hackney. Me and my mates used to think Joey from Bread was well fit. Joey from Bread was a powerful man. Yeah. Although I liked Grandad best. I want me pudding.
I want me pudding.
I want me pudding.
Didn't Joey change into someone else?
Joey changed from Peter Howitt into another guy, inexplicably. We were all supposed to just carry on watching.
I could never do that. Even
that.
In Neighbours when Lucy changed.
Lucy you changed.
You could never change into someone else.
I could never take that.
We're shapeshifters,
I'd
man.
I'd like Doctor Who myself.
I'm not into shapeshifting. It's crazy. My first love was when I was 10 with Madonna in 1985. All very innocent at the time, although it actually says innocence at the time, but I don't fancy her now. Why not Alan Jepsen? Hi, Russ and team.
She's got man hands.
Say that about Madonna. Absolutely. She's a lovely woman. She's my first love was Roland Ratt. I was aged 5 and I thought I could marry him. I'm 27 now and I've never been in love yet.
Wow. That's an interesting way to regard Ron. He ripped feeds, he. I liked Roland Rat. I never loved him. I never let it become sexual. He ripped feeds, he.
Hated it.
What'd you hate him for, Trev?
Awful rubbish.
Oh, right, I suppose. Awful rubbish.
Awful rubbish.
Father, what is this? Have you seen this rat? It's absolutely awful.
He hates it because it's an animal that's risen up.
Yeah, risen up against him. I'm going to kill that rat. That's what I'm going to do. Then I'm going to watch Labohem. This massively must stop, Papa. On the subject of first love, I met my first love at last orders in the finest of local establishments, the Crown Inn, at the sweet old age of 16. It was a much older lady named Cheryl. I then cemented the first love in the local graveyard against what I remember to be a gravestone.
Oh, dear.
Of a that told memories of a miner called Clive, Stephen Crook.
Why does he remember of what I remember to be? If you're in a graveyard, that's not a weird memory to have.
Yeah, it's not like it might be a graveyard or it could have been the courtyard of Lakeside Shopping Centre.
No, he goes,
there certainly were a lot of dead bodies about.
It's very odd.
And also, why would you remember the inscription on the tombstone? Because I think if someone was having it off with me and it was like the consummation of a first love, and while we're having that sex, they were secretly reading about a dead miner.
I mean, it's bad enough when people watch the telly.
It's bad enough,
but
isn't
reading
it?
Reading gravestones.
Well, I don't know.
You were saying you were watching Dig the other day while someone performed a sex act on you, Matt.
I think I was saying that.
Yes, you did. Were. I let you dig and you said that some woman was performing a sex act on you and you were just happily watching Dig. Trevor's marriage isn't real. You don't concentrate during sex. I'm the only person who can be trusted. I challenge you two to come up with one thing that will embarrass me on air. I dare you. I double dare you say anything that embarrass me. Let's go to a track. Let's listen to the Yardbirds for
don't
your
do
love.
It, Matt. You have the power not to press that button.
Press for your love, on. Matthew Morgan.
Now, let me think. Embarrass Russell Brand.
Could you
Let's
do
sing.
It? I'm unembarrassable.
Suppositories.
For your love.
Suppositories.
For your love.
Waxy bullets. Waxy bullets.
We're going to be talking about a colonic irrigation right after For Your Love.
Hello, is that my PA? Have you got my suppositories? Helen, I need my suppositories. Hey, Russell, here's your bag of medicines. This happened. I was in a taxi. Here's your bag of medicines. He went through it like a rat. Where's my suppositories?
Listen, them suppositories are a choice. I was just trying to get everything in tip-top shape for carnival season. Put the Yardbirds on.
Was the lesion
on.
A true choice as well?
What?
The little lesion.
The what lesion?
Yeah, the little internal lesion, the little scratch.
There's no... Listen, Trevor, some of us have adventurous sex, not with women who live in other continents that we're not married to. Some of us during sex don't watch DVDs, but concentrate on the sex. That can sometimes lead to... bruising, internal bruising. When you're having proper sex, these things are risks. Matt, if you're not watching the telly, Trevor, if you're not married, put the Yardbirds on.
No, because you have the power. Ain't good now.
Yeah.
Trevor, do you know about the scratch on his winkle?
Yeah, I've seen the scratch. He got it out in a meeting. We had a meeting on Thursday where we were trying to get a new producer for our new show, and he said, "Hold on, Trev, can you have a look at this?"
Yeah. Nice.
Whips it out at the dinner table, and I confirmed that it was indeed a scratch, and he should just give it a little time off.
But now it's fine.
Yeah.
Is it?
Yeah, of course it is. I'll show you it.
Come on in.
Oh, for God's sake, you boys!
Hang on, that lady's
thank heavens.
Please don't take photographs of my dinkle.
This is radio. Oh, good heavens.
Oh, there's another one now. But what a night we had! We're all young, we're alive, and I'll suffer those scratches for your love!
It's a gnarled and wizened
thing. What are the Yardbirds on? This thing's gone on for ages!
That looks like a puppy dog's toy. It's been chewed.
Do you know, it's funny you should say that, Trevor, because my dog's the most satisfied hound in Christendom. Right, never gives me any trouble. Put for your love on!
Then, Trevor, you ready for that?
Put the Yardbirds on!
Let's have the Yardbirds.
You make me sick. You're all fired! This is Russell Brand on Six Music. Today is called Sunday, but it ain't that different from other days. I'm here with Matt Morgan and Trevor Cocky Locky. How the hell are you boys now? I hope you're pleased with yourself. Are ya?
You dared us, we did it.
Oh, come on! You can't destroy me with your anecdotes about suppositories. Let's have a look at what sort of emails and stuff like that.
What are those suppositories for, then?
Listen, I don't want to talk about...
I'm helping you out here. Something's come up. You can't just... You know, what goes up must come down.
Let's talk about that colonic irrigation, Matt. Let's talk about you sat sweltering on a bench with your legs gaping like an unwelcome mother with a mutant in the pit of her gut, grunting and squelching. We went to have colonic irrigation yesterday, me, Matt and Trevor did. Them two went first,
it's
right?
It's colonic hydrotherapy.
What's the difference?
Because that lady said irrigation means you put water in.
Trevor, turn your phone off. What's wrong with you? It's happened once. Well, don't you learn? What are you going to do? Leave the show, marry another South American woman and live another lie? What's wrong with you? Well, what are you going to do, Matt? Leave the show, put on that Metallica thing and have someone lick the back of your legs?
Metallica.
Okay, so yeah, we went for this colonic hydrotherapy with that woman called Vel. It was in Harley Street we went to. Actually,
nice
Adam, we're going to give you the bill for that because we thought BBC should pay for it because it is actually content. It's content for the show, isn't it, really?
Well, there was a lot of content, let's be honest.
Ultimately, this show is made up of our whoopsie.
Russell's there's not trying to hide this. Pumping out the toilets at a festival.
How dare you?
Yeah.
It was glorious. It was like a Technicolor dream coat, what was coming out of the back of me. Glorious looking stuff.
Trev had some weird stuff coming.
I had people panhandling for gold through mine.
The only panhandling you do with your trousers and pants down is when you're lingering in a Soho lavvy trying to make up your income, trying to pay for yet another divorce, you bigamist. So like, hey, listen, right, so what's really interesting about it is like we went there and like those two went first and the woman, Vel, who's very attractive, wasn't
beautiful,
she?
African lovely lady.
Very attractive, very nice big bottom and quite big boots.
And she said the word for frog in Zulu.
Yeah, what was it? It was just a click. A
bit like that. No, it's no.
I've got...
Oh God. That's how you say frog in Zulu, but when's that ever going to come up?
Well,
unless Trevor goes to Africa and wants to kill one.
He knew the word and asked her to say it. Yeah.
Probably because it's part of his litany of crimes against amphibians.
Anyway, let's not get involved in that.
Why not?
Set the scene.
Set the scene.
Okay, so we went there, we got there a bit, and the woman was had to talk us through this Vel, she was called, attractive.
For an hour.
Talking us
Russ
through it. I was so bored.
It was so rude. You got the newspaper out, you started texting.
Me and Matt were mucking about at first, being all silly, going, we'll stick it up each other's. Oh, would you mind putting it up? Well, what are you going to be wearing while we do this? Here, put this on. What kind of bra are you wearing? Do you love me? Have you got a boyfriend? And she went, look, you're going to have to be a bit more serious about sticking this pipe up your bum. And I sort of thought, well, if we're going to have to be serious, I'm just going to sit and read. So I sat and read.
You sat and sulked, let's be honest.
You can call
it
sulking.
What did she say to you? And she goes, oh, he was getting impatient. And she'd been doing this hour talk, Chris.
Boring.
And she goes, patience is a virtue. And he went, so's brevity.
So's brevity, dear. Just get things done. Because it wasn't about telling us about colonic irrigation. It just was, I'm going to enjoy being in a position where I can arp on.
No, because me and Trevor got really interested in it.
We got really into it. We learnt stuff about our bodies.
Yeah, well, I've learnt something about your body, Trevor. It contains fluids that mankind should never have to witness. It was mad. So Trevor went in one room, Matt went in the other, and I was kind of like hovering between them in what can only be described as a Michael Carrick role, linking them both of them up. So it was wonderful actually, because there was like whale music playing in both the rooms, right? And Trevor was laying all beautiful and composed in his gown. It's a wonderful contraption that you sit upon. You have to sort of lay on your back with your legs sort of squatted and back as if you're trying to roll over backwards, and into a sort of a little basin. A tube is fed into your botticello, and you don't, the effluvia and emergent substances don't go down the tube, but in fact just come out in the traditional fashion, fall into like a chamber pot, sort of a commode, and then go into a transparent pipe, and you see them whizzing by. It's like Scalectric, but with crap.
Yeah, and it's not the crap,
like
electrics.
A log flume or like one of those water slides.
It is like a log flume. You see them go by you. I was really fascinated by that, because that is pure eschatology, isn't it? That pipe could have not been seen through, and you wouldn't see it go whizzing by.
I think that's half the fun, isn't it, to see what.
At least
there.
Half. I loved it going by. Yeah. Right, and then sort of like, so Trevor was there, all beautifully composed and delicate, and sort of with the maternal glow of a new mother. Went into Matt. Matt was like a grunting, squalid little Viking, like a Middle Earth dwarf, snuffling. And every time I walked in there, he sat there with his legs up. It was like someone who just had a spiteful vindaloo. Oh, crikey, there I go again. Matt was trying to fight it. Trevor saw it as this beautiful spiritual experience. Matt regarded it as a sort of aquatic rape, as if he was at a war with Nemo, King
pain.
Of the Sea.
I was in pain.
You weren't you?
I had to have a hot thing on my stomach. I just had like. Crush it. It was like having diarrhea. It was awful.
I think that's because you were fighting against it, Matt. Trev went with it.
I'm not passive. Like, if Trevor's ever in prison, then good luck to him.
Trev's going to be very popular if he has to do Bird. They're going to love him in the showers. He'll make a fortune. Whereas you, Matt, you better have a lot of fags to swap, because you ain't giving out at the other end, sunshine.
Russell was very sweet, actually, when he kept coming in I don't know if it was sweet to you because you sound like you're having good fun.
With Trevor, the whale song just seemed beautiful and like a natural part of the environment. With Matthew, you felt that he should have been listening to Enter Sandman or something. Sort of sat there all angry.
Because I was fighting it. It hurt. It was like it fills you up with water and then it blasts out. So I wasn't letting it fill up too much. So it was a constant battle against this machine for 45 minutes.
Raging against the machine, even though that machine was in your own bum.
I know. And I think I put the pipe up far too far.
Did you? How far up the pipe? Because you only meant to put the pipe up an inch, as was my understanding.
I sort of fed it in. I wasn't sure how much had gone in.
Because you had to feed it up yourself. It was a lot of humiliation, wasn't it? You used to have to put on those 90s, then backwards 90s. Trevor's brought it in as a prize for someone. Yeah, that you put on like a schmock that's open at the back so you can see your little bum.
How revolting that he's brought that in.
I know, Trevor,
it's
not also
a schmock, it's a smock.
The cord round your.
I don't know what a schmock is.
That's a schmock!
That's a Yiddish term for somebody who throws water in.
Is it?
Yeah.
The worst thing about it is it fills you up and you think, oh no, it's the same feeling as, oh my god, I've got diarrhea and I've got to go now. And the woman comes in and goes, hello, are you comfortable? Is everything all right? And all you're thinking is, get out,
I'm not pooing in front of you. Yeah, I find you attractive. It's difficult to poo in front of someone you find attractive.
I have poo problems pooing in front of, you know.
Normal people in everyday life. Matt, someone comes around my house asking for a poo in the middle of, could I come in for a poo? I couldn't do one at work. Couldn't, don't you? You
haven't. Well, it's happened, but not recently. I've got.
Yeah, it's happened quite frequently, quite a lot. And if there's a girl around my house, Matt goes, I can't go with her here.
Yeah, so imagine.
Can you make her wait in the garden?
No, that's never happened. But imagine that, and then the lady comes in, she's leaning over you, touching things, you're thinking,
there
he goes again. So you go, thank you, yep, right, great.
Right, jolly good, okay, move along, quickly, okay. Knowing that there's a big well of matter and liquid within you.
Yeah, and then she shuts the door, she goes, and comes out.
Bursts out of you. It is nice, the relief of it bursting out of you, but yeah. I felt so exposed and vulnerable. I went after those two had finished having theirs, Trevor all tranquil and beautiful, Matt like a grunting, squat little ape man.
I wasn't, I was in pain, wasn't I?
I know, it's really funny. There was one bit where they've been doing it for about 10 minutes, and I've just been in with Trevor, and Matt sat there all snarling at the world, resenting the hose pipe within him. And I goes, oh, Trevor's in there. He's really relaxed. He's really enjoying it. And Matt went, is he? And got angry and tried to look relaxed with anger. Right, I'm gonna enjoy this then. Just sat there all.
It was horrible. There was a moment where I thought, well, I'm pulling.
Were you gonna put it out?
Because she said, like, you saw so much water go in there, and then you think, well, that's all in there, and then you get these pains quite high up in your stomach, and you're meant to hold this vibrating massager thing on your stomach. That was too
and
much.
Only on your stomach, Matthew. What you did was, it was an abomination. And then I had to go after the pair of them. I went on my own, and them two sat at the end of my bed eating crisps and popcorn and watching me get colonic irrigation like it was entertainment.
Some of the stuff that came out of you.
Nice, I thought.
What about that musket ball that came out of me?
Matt had a musket ball in him. Were you in the American Civil War, Matthew?
I think
like General Custer's armpit and stuff that came out of you. Ridiculous.
I think it was a pee.
It wasn't. Well, I haven't eaten peas for a long time.
I know, but that's what they say happens. They say you can have peas.
How would a pea not decompose, though, Trish?
Well, it gets lodged in one of those little pockets in the colon. And
Lodged in the colon pocket?
Yeah,
exactly.
And then it can cause diverticulitis. If you'd have paid attention instead of texting and reading your own article, which you must know how it goes in The Guardian.
Good, then, that article.
Yeah, but you shouldn't have read it.
I was just trying to see what was happening in it. I can't remember. Sometimes they print it a bit different, change bits, like some of my odd analogies. Right, so let's listen to, we're going to listen to a session track now from Massive Attack, Karma Coma. This would be good to listen to this. I think there's a trail before, but then Karma Coma would be interesting to listen to that. Then we're going to be back with Trevor's Sonic Enigma, Matt's Cultural Review. Noel Gallagher, don't know how he's going to turn up. I've got a strange feeling about him today. Got some interesting people in the studio. Trev's brandishing his poop smock like it's a flag seized from an enemy.
Poop smock, no, it's clean.
Yeah, unknown.
Mine was soaking wet with sweat. Why was it so horrible for me and everyone else?
Because you were fighting it. You were looking at it as if it was a scene from Prick Up Your Ears, the Joe Orton autobiography. The rest of us saw it as a sort of a medical service. Let's listen to Karma Coma. Matthew, you just got to chill out, man. Good to have access to them BBC archives. What, after what they done to Dad? Burning not only but also or something. Do you know about that?
Yeah,
he done loads of crazy stuff.
This Steptoe and Son episode's got.
They burned Steptoe and Son. They done some crazy things. Was that BBC? Things. Yeah, we're talking about First Love, aren't we? If you've got a First Love email or something there, Trev?
I do. It's from John. It's quite funny. I met my first love in the Army Cadets.
Nice.
Didn't really work out, though.
If there's one thing that the Army's for, it's for introducing young men to each other and getting them to fall in love.
Apparently, it says, it didn't really work out as I spent every afternoon shouting at her and making her do press-ups.
I don't know.
Well, I went out of this girl once. Actually, angry. It was that Cassie. You know that Cassie who sold that kiss and tell on me?
Yeah.
Right, she told me that she went out with a boyfriend before.
Her and another. Is this bad? Can you say this?
Yes. Oh. She went out and, like, her boyfriend was like, he used to be in the army or something, and he used to get her and another girl to do, like, loads
of. You can't say this.
Yes, I can.
Press
ups. Used to do, like, mad stuff, make them have baths together, and would shout at them and that, and, like, he was a jewel. So, right, you two, get off of each other. Right, you comb your hair. Kiss that one on the bum. And she, really? Yeah, she told me all about it.
What, and because he was high up in the army, because he was treated like that and he wanted to do that in his private?
I think it was like he was, yeah, he was on the receiving end of it. It's like that bully syndrome, you know, bullies used to be bullied, that thing. A bully boy spiral, reaching back in time, man. We're all bullies in our way, that is our crime, man. You like Jack Kerouac, Trev, you'll be into that beat
I
style
don't
poetry.
Like Jack Kerouac.
Don't you?
Well, I've never read him. So
you should, Trev, because he's ever
judgment.
So good.
Yeah, is he good?
You should have read him while you were in your little Superman sickbed as a kid.
Lawrence Ferlinghetti that was the reference I made.
Oh, I'm so sorry.
But
I'm so
sorry.
I'm
not
sorry,
asking
Trevor.
You to be sorry.
Why don't you just pull me up when I'm trying to make a radio show? I'm so very. Why don't you read out that email thing?
Just read it out, haven't I?
You read it out already?
Yeah, we just heard it.
What
we
was
just
it?
Had a conversation about it.
Oh, yeah, I remember. Nice, I enjoyed that.
Read it again if you want.
No, let's not do that.
What's your first love story then, Russ?
Well, I've got quite a few. Well, I mean, like...
Quite a few first loves?
Yeah.
It was a big orgy, was it?
I'd fall in love quite regularly.
There must have been a first one.
You shouldn't put your elbow in there, Trev. It's audible. He's putting the elbow on his microphone.
He's
dirty yellow
elbow.
He's putting the elbow. Cat down a whoopsie in my beret.
But you've got so many first love stories, there's none to tell.
A logical point here, there can only be one first love.
Okay, well... Well,
all right. You can think about it, and we'll come back to
you
later.
I remember when I was 7, going, "Mum, when I'm old enough, can I marry you, please?" So it's my mum, really. I wanted to marry my mum when I was younger.
That's so cute.
It's nice, isn't it?
Yeah.
Nice to want to marry a mum.
Yeah.
Certainly not disturbing and macabre.
isn't that all we want to do?
All of us.
Yeah. Wasn't that interesting?
Hold on, it's Noel, hello.
Yeah, man.
Wait. I've got you on loudspeaker on my mobile, but you're not very audible. How's it going? You okay?
Yeah.
Can we ring you? Why are you talking like that?
I don't know. I'm just in a funny mood today.
You're in a funny mood? All right, I'll tell you what. Can we ring you back in 5 minutes and put you through the desk?
Yeah, man.
Is he not coming in?
Are you coming in? Because you said you were going to give me a present.
Yeah, but I was in my... I've been out in the sticks all weekend, so I'm on the way to the airport from the other side of London.
Yeah, but. Another male role model lets me down. Thanks a lot, Noel Gallagher. You're just like my bloody father. Thanks a lot. Sat outside with him in my little coat with me hood up, waiting for him on a Saturday for a man that never came. Then people wonder why I grow up strange. No, can we give you a ring in a minute and put you through the desk? Oh, Christ.
He's put the phone down on you. You've offended him.
Oh, he's all right. No, so what did you want to talk about?
Well, I was just going to say, it's interesting, that last thing about the fella that got off with his girl in the graveyard. I think that happens quite a lot, actually.
Well, people get off of each other in graveyards.
I think so. Yeah. I think it's a quiet place to go for that sort of first love experience.
Among the dead, Trevor. Mm. Love among the dead.
Well, it's interesting, isn't it?
How sex that's, and
that,
death.
You know, sex and death and this sort of...
What is the corollary? What, the moment of orgasm when you forget yourself?
Well, that's one illusion you can...
You look like you had one just then, Trevor. The shudder that would just pass through your body.
Yeah, I don't like
that. I think it's just when you're that age, it's very hard to find somewhere you're allowed to go.
Yeah.
So it's either the park and a graveyard comes under that thing. I don't think
it's kind
teenagers of think... The thing about love is it's about mortality and death. I think we should go to the graveyard and lay on a gravestone and
let's embrace death. But it's there, isn't it? It's interesting.
Death, my spectre lover, my phantom lover. Have we got someone on the phone?
We have got someone on the
phone. Let's talk to him.
All right, hello.
Have we? What, they're on the
phone? Yeah, lift up. Hello. Mick? That's the wrong thing. Mick? Hello,
yeah,
Mick?
Russ, how are you, mate?
I'm really well, mate. Sorry there. We couldn't hear you for momentarily because, foolishly, we left Matt Morgan in charge of the desk. It was too...
That's okay, fella. Don't worry.
So, I was very interested to read your text. Would you tell us about your first love, Mick?
My first love was Darth Vader when he walked in Star Wars.
Yeah, the very first appearance. I mean, he was impressive.
Oh, he was, but it's just that deep breathing, weren't it?
Yeah.
You are my son. Never underestimate the dark side of the Force.
He was always all about that Force, wasn't he?
But the thing was, it was all about the fact that when, you know, he was walking and he had those sort of like PVC trousers on, they were just sort of rubbing together, weren't they?
Has it affected you in later life, Mick?
Mate, I'm a total pervert now.
That's the spirit.
Do you know what I wear in the morning?
I mean, I'm thinking an erection and a smile, dear. But hit me with some facts.
No, that's the first thing. The second thing is I put on a big rubber jock strap.
Do you?
Yeah, because of Darth Vader.
Because of Darth Vader, you put on a big rubber jock strap.
Well, in case he comes round.
but really, if he came round, it's Dave Prowse, the Green Cross co-ed. Oh, hello, my lovely. Oh, look left, look right. Hello, put that away. Where'd you get that rubber jock strap from? Oh, my God. That's
I'll tell you what though, it's definitely influenced my sex life, totally.
Well, you be careful here, because remember, this is Sunday in the daytime, so, you know, we're on the BBC and, you know, Her Majesty and all that sort of gear.
Talking.
Absolutely. I'd never be rude, Russ.
That's the spirit, Mick. I mean, I suppose it's not really that important, but what's your sexual orientation?
Mate, I don't care as long as it's warm and hot.
That's the spirit. You're a bit like Trevor Locke in a way.
Is it rubber-based?
The institution of marriage means nothing to that man.
Is it rubber-based?
I do prefer men, though.
Do you? Yeah, I'm not surprised. I mean, some men are dead handsome. I quite like the look of some fellas. I'd never want to touch one once. Well, I did touch one once, but like,
I heard about your story in the toilet when you were trying to be a rent boy.
Yeah, it didn't work out that well, to tell you the truth. That was Matt's idea, I think. Was it your idea, Matt?
Have you still got a sticky eye, though?
Come on, Mick, we trusted you. Hey, Darth Vader's had a powerful effect on you. Matt was more into Ben Kenobi, though, so he prefers musty little sexual encounters with sand people, who he also secretly hates.
I think he likes his lightsaber better.
Oh, dear. Oh, right, okay, we're getting into all sorts of crazy puns. Mick, thank you very much for your time.
I love you.
I love you, mate. You look after yourself. Take it easy. Ta-ra now. Bye-bye. I liked him. He sounded a bit
like the way he said, I'm a total pervert.
Oh, I'm a total pervert. He had no problem with it. And why should he? He's not hurting anyone. Well, let's just assume he's not. it's easier for us legally to assume that he's not wading through life, breathing through like some sort of asthmatic inhaler with his lightsaber attacking folks. Okay. What about when we met Paul Weller? We were a bit nervous around him, weren't we? I felt a bit nervous to meet Paul Weller.
I think he was all right.
I think he was more scared of us than we were of him.
That's bears, Trevor. Paul Weller. True, Trevor don't know the difference between Paul Weller and bears.
He's a magnificent man, though, isn't he?
I liked my favourite bit in General Ben was a town called Manis. Trevor, let's listen to That's Entertainment, shall we?
Yeah, I love this song. It's the most British song you can get.
Always
all the lyrics.
When I was in Australia, because I followed a girl what I didn't love properly and didn't love me, and I was all alone. That's Entertainment was my only friend. Little Nufta. Listen to that.
No, it was. Listen to this, and it made me think when I was homesick,
it's a brilliant song.
British thing was amazing.
It's one of the great songs. Listen to the lyrics, he goes watching the news and thinking,
not eating your tea. Yeah, well, as well, how old is he when he wrote this? Sort of about 18 or 19. So, like, when he goes, sort of says, like, you know, never done nothing type stuff, that's not ironic. That's just simply how he would have spoken.
Yeah, I think
it's delightful, I must say. Should we listen to it?
Why did you take the mickey out of my Australian love affair?
Because Matt.
Trevor, he's called me Trevor twice.
I know, but I think it's because when I do that tone of voice, that cynical, loathing, detesting.
Yeah, you're getting a bit of the barrel today, which I'm quite glad about. Yeah. Well, not really. I've just been shot to pieces today, but yeah.
It's nice.
And you got off with me in one of the records.
What do you mean? Oh, when we were the photos. We had a photo done. That'd be a nice photo. We'll have that up on the website soon. I didn't get off with him.
No, but it looked like it, didn't it?
Don't say that. Mick will come round here dressed as Darth Vader and use the force on us. We'll be choking for days. Hey, come on, let's listen to that.
Let's
entertainment.
BBC
Six Music. And we listen to Russell Brand on Six Music. There's a couple of versions of that, though, isn't there?
Yeah, that's not the most aggressive.
You like the more aggressive one?
Yeah, but that's good.
Is that the one you used to comfort you in Australia? The more aggressive one. Perhaps that one would be better because as I remember, when you used to phone me from Australia, you were much more like this. Oh, that's entertainment. The fruit's better over here. That's entertainment. You were going on about everything's better over in Australia, weren't you?
Everywhere else. We discussed this yesterday.
There's not a very good culture, and the television's rubbish.
Yeah, you said that in the news in Australia, the people go, right, this is the news. There's been a scandal politically. And we've got a statement here. Well, actually, I completely justified. Look, mate, that's a crock. You're lying, mate.
Come on, Bill. That's rubbish, mate.
on the news. We're English. People like that. Michael Burke wouldn't do that. He'd go, well, Prime Minister, with the greatest respect, where are the facts to back that up? Even Paxman, the rude as well, would never go, oh, come on, Bill. Would he?
No, never. It's funny, though.
It was funny. Sounds funny. Right, so we've got a couple of challenges for Trev. Here's a challenge, Trev. Honour your marriage vows.
But as well as that,
Trevor, you've got to come back to that. You can't have that floating around in the ether.
I do. Well,
he can have all sorts of things floating around. I've seen him have a colonic irrigation. Look, I've seen the things he's got floating around.
I watched yours, Russell, when yours was. What's that thing?
Why is there something flashing in here?
So someone's ringing us.
I wonder who's ringing us.
Yeah.
A lot of stuff came
probably
out.
Probably Trevor's wife. Really. Yeah, hold on.
A lot of stuff came out of you, didn't it?
Loads. I think it really felt good for me.
Yeah.
carrying a lot of nonsense, probably because all them years of drug addiction, I must have clogged up myself with all sorts of junk.
And I think there's emotional stuff in there. That's
emotional
the
stuff.
The woman said that it cleans you out emotionally as well, didn't
yeah,
she?
Yeah, she said you could burst into tears at the end.
Yeah, well, I burst into tears at the beginning, at the point of penetration. Boy, I missed my suppositories that day. There's a competition here for, incidentally, my bum's in lovely shape. Competition here, Summer Sunday's tickets. You can win a pair of tickets, you, that's you, to go to Summer Sunday, but spelt like an ice cream sundae, which is, that's in Leicester on the 11th to the 13th. You can see people like Richard Hawley, Elbow, The Young Knives, Cold Cut and Bell and Sebastian. Six Music are doing loads of live shows from that festival. If you want to know more, go to our website. Or what have you got to do? You've got to guess what a sun track is. Is that what you've got to do? What have you got to do, Adam? You just tell me.
I know what to do.
Tell us then, Trev.
I know what to do. If you hear the guillemots being played...
Yeah.
You must behave like a guillemot, which is a seagull that is resident to these islands, and ring us up and do the sound a guillemot makes when it nests. And then if you get that right... Not that. That's when it's mating, probably.
Ah, Trevor! Get off me!
That's it.
I didn't consent to that! Get off my bum feathers!
That's it. If you do that, then you get tickets to that.
Get off my bum feathers! Then yeah. You can have tickets to this event, Summer Sunday, 11th to the 13th of August, Richard Hawley Elbow and all that stuff.
What an eccentric competition.
It is an eccentric competition.
Sounds like a good one. So if you listen out for the guillemots, if those guys should crop up, then give us a bell. Right, so, seagulling. Interesting, that should be mentioned, because Noel gave me a ring yesterday asking about seagulling, because I mentioned it on one of the television programmes, because it's this craze that's sweeping the nation, seagulling. Don't worry, we'll ring Noel later.
I think we'll answer that phone.
What is that phone? What's
I think it's a mystery call. It could be from...
Noel Gallagher don't know the phone number.
I know.
Let's just ignore it. It's hard.
You can't just answer a phone on radio, Trev.
Oh,
can you? It could be anybody. It could be a nutcase issue. All right, let's do it. Answer the phone then. Let's see who it is.
We've done it how?
Pick it up.
I know. Just lift it up.
Pick it up and put it through the desk. Hello? Hello? Hello?
It's a different line.
Why is it flashing in here? Strange. All right, so there's a challenge for Trevor now. You know we challenge Trevor to do things. Right, here's a challenge from Thompson. Trevor should wet himself on air to make him itchy. What's wrong with that challenge?
Well, it's a puerile thing.
What do you want to do then? Do you think someone's going to ever challenge you? Trevor should live his life according to a Dostoevsky novel, Crime and Punishment.
Something like that.
It's just too difficult to conduct.
The only thing with that is, do you remember when we were naked and all the stink? Well, no.
Stink? I do not recall a stink, mate.
I'm in the hoo-ha about us being
sat. Don't
naked.
Use the word stink to describe hoo-ha or nonsense in conjunction with nudity.
I didn't mention that.
What's that?
Yeah, don't mention that. What? We want to raise the tone of this show a little bit.
With Ali.
Crawling around in the gutter.
Ali, who's Ali?
Let's not go there.
Okay.
Ali.
Ali, no, something happened in an alley.
What, last night?
Yes.
Yeah. We went to my mum's 60th birthday last night.
Yeah, it was lovely.
I don't think, I don't remember raising...
I had a boogaloo in the garden.
You did, Trevor, you're a great dancer. Everyone loves you.
Shucks.
So this is a message from Kathleen and Marina. Trevor should dress in a pink tutu and walk down Oxford Street shouting, I'm a godmother. Fairy godmother.
I'm a godmother.
Godmother's funnier.
I'm a godmother. I'm a godmother. Who's going to trust him to instruct their child in the ways of Christianity? Well, actually, Matt and I have organised a surprise for you. Ain't we, Matt?
Am I going to be somebody's godmother? I would love to be somebody's godmother.
No, what, Trevor, that'd be ridiculous.
A godfather, then.
You'd indoctrinate that child
I'm
into a terrible
spiritual
lifestyle.
Person.
You're not, Trev. There's nothing spiritual about the way you conduct yourself.
It's not as nice as that.
Let's tell him.
I'm just going to be an uncle.
Yeah, tell him.
We've got a tutu. Like, we've bought it. You've got to do the rest of the show dressed in a tutu. Get your clothes off.
I beg your pardon?
Do the rest of the show in a tutu. It's over there.
See
that hanging up there, that tutu?
Actually, the top part just looks like one of my normal shirts.
It does, when you all dress up in pink and embarrass
skirt
us.
Doesn't look like
yeah, put that on, Trev, right?
Okay.
Get your clothes off. You'll be able to have a look at this on the webcam if you're not, we'll put photographs on the webcam so you can look at it another day if you want to.
I'm not walking down.
There's another challenge from you. This is from young Luke. Get some insects from the outside world and then get Trevor to lick them without eating them so he gets the full taste. We're going to do that as well. I think we've got some insects. I think they're ones that are in lollipops, so no actual insects have been harmed.
Okay.
My first love, says Brendan, turned out to be someone who had a gay older brother that he hero worshipped and wanted to find out what it's like to be with a bloke. All right. Ultimately, being used to fuel sibling rivalry, but at the time I was completely in love. It took me 3 years to stop wearing black and listening to low-key music. He's now a journalist in Palm Beach. That's nice. So what, Brendan fell in love with two brothers? Trevor's taken off his clothes now. The photographer's coming. As a youth, I fell in love with Marina from Stingray. She was very vulnerable, especially out of water. The puppet, I think, was based on Ursula Andress, so she had an added bonus. That's from Gary from Langnennock, I think somewhere in Wales. Did you like Maria?
I don't know who she is. I used to fancy
Marina.
Wilma Flintstone or Betty Rubble or one of them.
Betty Rubble?
Betty Rubble was dark haired, wasn't she? Her.
I think it was Wilma and Betty. You used to fancy Betty more.
Yeah.
I didn't fancy either of them.
Wilma was always moaning. Betty was more.
She was more fun, wasn't she? Yeah. She's more of a laugh. Trevor's getting his tutu on. Oh, Trevor, why don't you do that right by the microphone, like a nutcase would, if we let them in?
Well, it's just to give them a flavour.
People don't want that kind of flavour, Trevor.
I just bought tickets for the ballet.
And all the irony, Trev. Oh, I just bought tickets to the ballet, and now I'm a ballerina. What's next? Nijinsky coming in here and stamping on my throat? I hope so, Trevor. Right, so Trevor's going to be doing the rest of the show.
It was a racehorse, wasn't it?
It was a ballerina and all. You know perfectly well, Trevor.
This is fun.
Hello, Russell and friends.
Oh, this is nice.
You look nice, Trev.
I tell you what, we should all get these.
Yeah, you do look lovely.
Yeah, we're right behind fantastic. You, Trev.
You look ever so handsome. Nice to see you. Is that our competition winners? They've turned up. Yeah, he looks nice, doesn't he? Lovely. Okay, last week's competition winners are here, so we'll do Trevor's Sonic Enigma in a moment. What's your Enigma? Leave it, Trevor. Sit down. What's your Sonic Enigma this week?
I can't give that away, otherwise it would ruin the competition.
Have we got the news in a couple of minutes? Adam, is it news coming up?
Yeah, news comes up in 2 minutes. Yeah.
2 minutes.
2 minutes till the news. Yeah. Okay, right, well, so perhaps we should set up your Sonic Enigma.
Well, do you want to hear my trail? I've done a new trail for it.
Why are you doing that ridiculous position?
Look how he's
this
standing.
This is how a ballerina stands.
Ballerinas, Matthew. What are you standing in first position?
This is second
nonce.
Position, actually.
You look ridiculous.
I think it's third base, actually, but no, it's not.
Trevor, you're having sex with yourself again.
Can you sit down? That's really unnerving.
Yeah, sit down, Trevor.
I don't want to crush my tutu.
Trevor, you know, what you just sit down. Stop worrying about crushing your tutu.
Don't
just
you reckon
worry about
I should have been
the
dancer, Russ? Be honest.
Yeah, because then we wouldn't have to work with you. There are obvious immediate benefits to that idea. So we're going into the news in a minute. Let's hear your trail for your Sonic Enigma
trail
this week, Trevor.
Fire it off, baby.
Trevor, why are you talking about Sonic dancing to it.
This is haunting.
It's haunting. What's that been inspired by? What's that been inspired by, Trevor?
It just came to me. I try not to plan these things. I just go into the studio.
It's clear that you don't plan them because they're absolute
that's
junk.
Now, that's the jingle.
That's the jingle?
That is the jingle, yeah.
Trevor? So indulgent.
It
went on for 20 seconds.
Ghostly sound. It's not, doesn't say, it doesn't say, here's a competition on the radio.
It does. Just if you listen to those lyrics. Yeah, you picked up the tune. It's catchy, isn't it?
It's not catchy, Trevor. It's
quite
annoying.
Catchy.
Let's listen to our trail. Me and Matt done one.
Oh, Bill, I'm terribly worried about little Trevor.
Why? What's the problem, Sue Lock? What's wrong with our son, Trevor Lock?
He's upstairs and he's got all sorts of mental problems. I think one day it might come out in some sort of enigma.
I think it will come out in enigma. I said to you when you were pregnant, let me punch it out now, then we can have it for dinner. But you insisted on birthing the fool. Now he makes enigmas.
Well, we need something to clear up the mice around the village.
I know! We'll raise our son to be a brutal animal killer, shall we, dear?
Oh, do what you like with him. I'm bored of the little twit.
Good, that was, wasn't it, Matt? Yeah. Me and Matt done that. That's how we think of you, Trev. We regard you in that manner.
I've noticed, yeah.
Okay, we won't listen to the actual Sonic Enigma. We'll listen to that after the news, but it's going to be real exciting. But first, let's have a little bit of news to see what's going on in this crazy world of ours. I always regret it when I throw some news like that, because it's often been a tragedy. So let's do a more sober, here's the bloody news. All right, let's hear Trevor's Sonic Enigma. We played you the trail just now. Here's the enigma itself. Have a listen to it.
All right, mate, cotton chips, please.
Or would you like a satellite or a plate of mushy peas?
No, mate, I'll just have cotton chips, please.
A sausage roll or a pasty or some onion rings.
Just cotton chips, please, mate.
Oh. Cotton chips.
It's sort of the usual Elvis impression that tends to creep into Trevor's work. Meandering, long, confusing. If you know what track that's referring to, text us 64046, email us russell.6music@bbc.co.uk. What did you make of that, Matt?
Well, obviously the Elvis connection, the overlongness of
the
it.
The rain all. In the background, that seems to be a near constant
feature.
That's
the fat frying, surely.
That's the fat frying. He uses the same sound effect as he always uses for rain or toilets being flushed and the other junk that he churns out for us. Trevor. Can you even begin? Oh, I'm a broken man. Can
I
you
feel like I'm getting a consistency now. I'm weaving into
you're consistently
consistent
rubbish.
Themes.
You are consistently awful at making Sonic Enigmas. There's no doubt
like
about
a
that.
Tapestry. There's motifs that return each
They're not
week.
Motifs. Don't refer they to are. These things as motifs, Trev. Like the Sonic Enigma is not an artistic movement, all right?
You've seen the way he's put his ballet shoes on?
Yeah, professionally properly. And skillfully, professionally. As if he's done it hundreds of times. Yeah. Trevor's dressed as a ballet dancer.
I think I should have
been
Trevor, a ballet dancer.
Pick up your phone, go out onto the streets of London and dance and pass your mobile phone to a person and get them to describe your dancing. If you leave now, we won't have to look at you any longer.
Horrible thing to say.
Go on.
Go on. Go out into the, take your phone, go onto the streets, and then we'll do a dance and get someone on the street to describe your dancing. We'll
You'll
do
have
it
to
in
give
the next
me
link.
Your phone, because my phone is going to die.
Yeah.
give him your phone, Matt. Last week's Sonic Enigma winners are here. Come into the studio, lads. Walk through that door. Set there. So you just go out into the street and do some dancing.
Okay.
You all right? Okay. He said that. I like the glum acceptance that he's taken. Okay. I'll go out onto the street.
Go outside.
Just go outside. Find someone to describe your dancing.
I don't know
what the telephone number is.
That mic's not
right. Okay, we'll call you.
Yeah, we'll call you
and put you through.
How long do you need? 5 minutes?
We've got 5 minutes, Trev. We're going to play a track.
I've actually done that before, Matt.
Run outside.
It's about time you did, because you look like you're someone who should be doing it.
Get someone who's good and we'll describe what you're doing well.
Right, okay, so last week's Sonic Enigma winners are here. Come to this microphone, chaps. What's your names? Nick and Steve?
Chris and Steve.
Chris and Steve. Speak right into that microphone as if you're the Supremes.
Hello.
The Supremes would not stand distant like that. Your face must be within 6 inches.
Now Trevor's gone, we could use chairs.
Hey, sit
There's
down.
Chairs around, lads. Get chairs.
Sit yourself down. Yeah. What was the Sonic Enigma that you answered correctly?
It was Pull Shapes by the Pipettes.
Oh, yes, well done. The Pipettes. Trevor wanted the Pipettes to come in here, but... alas, they're not going to because they're frightened of Trevor, I think was the reason they gave.
So.
They said they wouldn't feel comfortable being here with someone with such obvious sexual attraction to them and someone with the history that Trevor's got. One need only glance at MySpace. What did you think of this week's Sonic Enigma?
I think it's easy.
Oh, really?
I think it's really easy.
Too easy. We've got it straight away.
We're not going to say it, don't worry.
Yeah,
panicking. Adam, not everyone is as bungling on air as you. These people, the competition here, they've got a cool, calm collectedness that we associate with people that have got no obligation to the show. Matt, what should we do? Now we've got Trevor out there dressed in all that gear. Trevor has actually gone out of the studio now. What should we do?
Let's mess with him. God, is he hidden his clothes?
I did it. I've already took his clothes and hidden them. Okay. As soon as you mentioned it, I took them out and I've hidden them.
Yeah.
But we have to reveal that so that on air he has the realisation of that. Because we don't want him not realising until after the show's finished that he's got no clothes.
No, I've got a better idea.
What?
We phoned DHL.
I've met that woman. Yeah, go on.
And we get his clothes sent somewhere on air, like well, now.
Let's call DHL.
And we get them sent to some location so he has to go there
and get them in his tutu. Brilliant idea. Adam, Steph, will you get to DHL on the phone and put them through to the desk, please, during the next track? And we'll make Trev listen to it on the phone.
Or we just get a cab, send them in a cab, go, can you take this man's
clothes? No, it's funny if it's DHL.
Yeah, we're advertising them now.
Other delivery services are available. There's that brown one. They're called something else. What are they? UHL.
UPS.
UPS. Well done.
We'll get one of them.
No undue prominence there. Okay. All right. So let's listen to what we're going to listen to now.
Shall we listen to Trevor's Sonic Enigma again?
Let's have another listen to Sonic Enigma while Trevor's not here. Then we can express our true feelings without protecting him.
Okay.
Oh, I made cotton chips, please.
Right. Okay.
Oh, you like Eccles Devil? Or a play of mushipies?
No, but I just have cotton chips, please.
But sausage roll, all pasties.
It's the way he says onion rings in a
moment. What's this bit? It's just indulgent.
It's really indulgent.
Just such a self-indulgent. Cotton chips, please, mate.
Cotton chip pen, mate.
Hmm. Why do you think he's doing this Elvis thing all the time? Do you think?
He's obsessed.
No, but I think he's angling for some sort of... Trevor really sounds like Elvis.
Oh, Trevor's like Elvis. Perhaps we should make a film about Elvis and have Trevor play Elvis. That's what he's clearly angling for, isn't he? He's clearly got something like that going on. All right, so if you know the answer to that, 64046, or you can email us. Remember what we said about that Guillemots thing? Wait till you hear the track, then text us and email us, because we can't answer the phone in here. So we're going to ring Trev, but first of all, let's have a little listen to Soul Wax, shall we?
Yeah.
And then we'll sort out this. We'll send off Trevor's clothes somewhere.
And if you're in the West End of London, you see a sad, pug-faced little ballerina.
Kick him to the floor. Stamp the life out of that fool. He's wondering, the BBC building, we're on Great Portland Street, so Trevor will be around there somewhere, because he's not got much imagination. He's got my phone,
which is upsetting.
That's all right, we can get you another phone, but how do we replace Trevor Locke with, I don't know, we could train a chimpanzee to wear a tutu, I suppose. Let's listen to Soul Wax, Too Many DJs. It's just me and Matt at the moment, because Trev's outside. We're just ringing Trevor now. Trev's outside, dressed as a ballerina. You'll be able to see, my God, that cookie woman's attractive, isn't she? There's a woman here selling cookies to all of us, but I understand she's married, isn't she?
I don't know.
So, like, Trevor's outside dressed in a tutu and stuff. What we've decided... Is Trevor up?
Trevor's here, but it's Peter talking.
Hello, Peter.
How are you?
I'm really well. Peter, can you what's Trevor doing at the moment?
Oh, he's doing a really athletic movement here. He's up on his toes, his backside.
Do you think this is Trevor? Hold on, Peter. Can you describe to us what happened between you and Trevor?
Well, we were just walking down the street and we saw this magnificent sight.
Who's we, Peter?
My wife and I.
Oh, what's your wife's name?
Lorraine.
And you and Lorraine are on holiday, are you?
That's right. We came all the way from Australia just to see Trevor dancing on the road.
Is that Trevor doing a voice?
I think it's Trevor doing a voice.
Beg your pardon?
Because you sound a little bit like Trevor doing an Australian accent, Peter.
Jeez, I hope not.
Yeah, I know.
I don't look like him anyway.
Then pass the phone to Trevor just quickly for us, Peter.
Oh, just a minute here, Trevor. He must talk to you. Hi. He doesn't believe it.
This is very cold.
Okay, fair enough. Right, pass the phone back. Are you cold, Trevor?
Yeah, I'm cold and I'm humiliated and embarrassed. Lisa Morris has just turned up.
All right, Lisa.
She nearly crashed the car when she saw me.
Send her upstairs, for she normally crashes that car anyway. It's the way she carries on the road. She's a menace. Tell you what, all right, pass the phone back to Peter now, Trevor, because we didn't believe it was you.
Yeah, people didn't believe it was you.
I know.
Hello, Peter. Sorry about that. You may have noticed that my tone was slightly acerbic. That's because I thought you were Trevor Locke. Now that I know you're not. Greetings, sir. Welcome to the Russell Brown Radio Show. Thank you for your help.
Thanks, Russell.
So,
how are you at all?
What we need you to do, Peter, is just to describe. Let me let you in on a secret, Peter. We've sent Trevor out of the studio dressed in a tutu. What we're going to do now is we're sending his clothes via a delivery service to Chariot, which is in London. It's a gay massage parlour and sauna and meeting place for gay people around Liverpool Street. I understand it's quite a nice establishment. We're going to be sending his clothes there. Don't tell Trevor that, because it's a little surprise for him that we're going to reveal to him in a minute. But first of all, Peter, could you instruct Trevor to begin his dancing now?
Well, he's been cavorting all over the place.
He's doing dancing now. He's doing it anyway.
He has been. He's getting rather tired. He's stopped that and he's starting to do... He's acting as a traffic policeman. He's holding up the traffic here now.
He's holding up traffic?
Yeah, but they're taking no notice whatsoever. He obviously doesn't look like a policeman, I don't think.
He doesn't have any authority, does he, in that tutu?
Well, he doesn't actually look like a bobby either.
He doesn't act like one, does he? Let's be honest.
Well, he's very friendly. I mean, now he's kissing the passers-by.
He's kissing passers-by.
Oh, God.
Peter, give the phone. Peter, thank you very much for your help and for authenticating
Thanks,
Trevor.
Peter.
Would you pass the phone back to Trevor now?
Hello.
Trevor, you all right, mate?
Yeah, do you want to speak to Lisa?
No, send Lisa up to the studio.
Up to the studio immediately. You're wanted there.
I'm coming. Oh, look.
Just send
I've
her
got,
up.
Trev, oh, this is fantastic.
Trevor? Trevor?
Yeah.
You know your clothes?
Oh no! Oh no!
We're sending your clothes to Chariot's gay massage parlour around Liverpool Street, because we know how much you like those kind of environments. You'll be able to pick them up later.
That's not nice. That's all I've been through. I've been so nice to you this weekend.
You've not been that nice, Trev.
Trev, all you got to do is drive there in your tutu and go ask at reception for them
and take an MP3, record it. And we can listen to that on next week's show. It'll be entertaining, won't it, mate?
I want to go to bed.
Sorry, Trev. Perhaps you can go to bed in Chariots. I'm sure the lads there will be grateful.
Bye-bye. Thanks very much.
He's trying to get back quickly. Let's call DHL or another
service. You shouldn't have blown that so soon to him.
No, okay, it's all right. It's fine. Let's go.
We'll tell him that they've already gone and we need to get those.
That's all right. We'll do it.
Now. I'm coming back now.
Trev,
he heard that.
Get him off the line. Bye, Trev. Love you. Love you. Right, okay, then. Let's cut Trevor off. So is this the number for the... Right, call the chariots first. Let's call them now. Let's go through some other people's love things. Right. Hello, Russell and friends. This is from James Smart, Wiltshire. During the summer of 2001, I was out of my head with first love. At the time, it felt like a Philip K. Dick-style brain attack, though in hindsight, I can laugh about it. But at the time, it was terrible. It was all very high concept, and the various ways I tried to cope with it included putting my head in an industrial freezer for 10 minutes at a time. Interesting way of coping. This fella... James Smart Wiltshire tried to cope with love by putting his head in an industrial freezer. Reading Victorian novels while wearing a Phantom of the Opera mask. Also reverse Buddhism, brainwashing, and interesting way of coping with love with James.
That didn't sound like it was a positive experience for him.
What, falling in love?
Putting his head in a freezer? What
it doesn't sound like it.
Silly.
Sounds like he had a terrible time of it.
Should we play a tune while we sort this out on the phone?
Okay, let's do it. What are we going to listen to?
Pearl Jam.
No! It's Wouldn't You Miss Me, Sid Barrett. Oh no, it's a live Pearl Jam. Why have you moved to Wouldn't You Miss Me?
Because it's a bit down and we need... I thought,
when did that decision get made? I like Wouldn't You Miss Me. Put it on now.
We're playing it in the
Put it on.
Oh God, hang on a minute.
All right, listen to Pearl Jam then. No, listen to Pearl Jam. Let's put Pearl Jam on, let's have a listen to that. This is Russ Brown 6 Music. Here's Pearl Jam.
This is Sid Barrett now.
Oh, is it? You've changed to Sid Barrett. Wouldn't You Miss Me? But this, we dedicate this to Trevor Locke.
Right, so Sid Barrett,
Sid Barrett, great. Let's listen to it.
Six Music.
Trevor's back. You all right, Trev?
No, I'm in a severe state of trauma. I don't know what's gone on.
We're just having a bit of a laugh.
What's it's not a laugh at my expense. It's just getting out of hand.
Did you enjoy that? What do you think? It's like army bullying or something?
Well, I don't know if this happens in the army.
Did you enjoy... Well, apparently it does. Apparently this is exactly the sort of thing
I'll tell you what
on.
Happened. Two little twins dressed in pink.
Yeah.
Came up to me. Wasn't that weird? I'm dressed in pink, in a pink tutu.
How
and then
old
two
are these twins?
Sort of angelic, I don't know, 9-year-old blonde twins. It was sort of...
Eerie, like
eerie,
Kubrick-esque.
Yeah, it's like...
Kubrick-esque, yeah. There'll be corridors of blood later, I'm convinced. You look ever so nice.
Thank you.
Right, well, anyway, Trev, we've sent off your clothes.
Well, I've put Matt Morgan's phone down my knickers.
He's got in my phone.
Down your knickers?
Yeah.
Did you do that again?
Yeah, and I'm hoping he gets some messages because I think it might be quite exciting.
Trevor, is that on your skin or in your neck against your material pants?
It's on one side, it's against my material pants, and on the other side, it's against my flesh knickers.
Oh, Trevor, look at Matt's getting involved. Matt's getting all aggressive.
He's putting his hand down his tutu.
Did you just touch his genitals?
Yeah. No, he didn't.
You. What's wrong with you?
He's just in a tutu. I'm wearing skin tight knickers, mate.
Down Trevor's pants.
Well, I want that out of there, please.
Come on, chaps. Let's concentrate on what we're supposed to be doing.
That massage part. This is silly.
Oh my God. Go there and get them.
If
you leave now, you could be by the end of the show. Yeah?
All right. I see what this is saying. You want me out of the show, don't you? Fair enough.
Well, actually, Trevor, you don't contribute much.
I understand.
What's this about you directing traffic?
Were you directing traffic out there dressed in that tutu?
Yeah, I thought it would be quite funny.
Sounds
and then
absurd.
I remembered this is not a TV show but a radio show and no one's watching.
Okay, let's have it. Right, so your Sonic Enigma, guess what? No one's entered it, Trev. people are abandoning it as an idea. People don't want to be involved anymore.
Really?
People were sustaining interest for as long as you were in the studio. The minute you went out, people thought, this is our opportunity. They sent us text messages saying, what's wrong with Trevor's Sonic Enigma? Thank God he's out of the studio, dressed.
It was a house of cards.
Darcy Bustle. He just fell down.
I thought I looked a bit more like Nurif.
Apparently it's too easy as well.
Yeah, should we listen to it live by Pearl Jam? Then we can wrap up this competition. Then we've got Matt's cultural review. Lisa Morris is here, probably traumatised by the sight of him nimble footing about in the road, terrorising twins from the sound of things.
Cake Lady's here as well.
Cake Lady's here? Yeah, let's get Cake Lady in. Why not? It's nice to... There's a woman here selling cakes to us. Why do you bring her here? Is it because you fancy her? Because she's beautiful?
No.
She's married? She told me that you've been harassing her, Trevor.
I haven't been.
You said you've been suggesting unusual and disturbing ingredients.
You can say anything now, erotic, and we know it's nonsense.
Erotic cookies. You've been asking her, mate.
Yeah, sparkle buns, dinkle sprinkles all over them. You suggested.
I never would use that sort of language.
Let's listen to Pearl Jam, shall we? Hello there.
Hello.
This is Russell. You know me, Russell, don't you? My code word is in fact Russell.
Sorry.
You know Russell. You normally pick me up in NW3.
Russell. Okay.
Yeah, my code word, my code is Russell.
Alright, okay.
That's my PIN number, which I'm going to have to change now, obviously. hello, I need you, you normally pick me up from in NW3, I won't say my address because I do a radio show. Do you know me? Do you know who I am? I'm not saying that, but do you remember me from, because I'm a regular user of your cab firm?
I'm not too sure, mate, I'm new here myself.
Ah, you're new here, well, welcome to the taxi firm. I've just got a job for you. I need you to pick something up from Gildea Street, Portland Place. Have you got that? Gildea Street off Great Portland Street, actually.
Street,
it's the Six Music building.
Gildea.
Yeah, that's Gildea. And I need you to pick up, how quickly you can get here? We need you here in sort of 5 minutes to pick up some clothes.
What, 5 minutes? We've got at least 15, 20.
15's cool, 15's cool. Yeah, just come as quickly as you can. And we need you to pick up some clothes and I need you to take them to Chariot's Massage Parlour. And that's in Shoreditch, that's just off Shoreditch High Street. And we need to, the driver's got to take some clothes in there. It's,
What number Gildea Street are you at?
It's called Westland House, it's the main street. What number is it?
99.
Now, you've got to pick up, the clothes of Trevor Locke and take them to, Chariot's Gay Massage Parlour in Shoreditch.
No problem, mate. What's your phone number there?
What phone number can we give? Might as well give Trevor's phone number.
Can we?
0207.
We'll phone you back in a minute. We'll call you back and give you the number.
No, because we want the... Yeah, tell me the number for Six Music. 0207-42... Alright, it's 0207-428-2644.
Or text us on 64046.
So, 15 minutes, yeah?
Yeah.
Cheers. Alright, mate. Thank you very much. See you in a minute.
Yeah, bye.
Trevor, your clothes is going on a special journey, ain't
it? Yeah, well, I hope you're proud.
I am proud.
Yeah. Can I have my phone back? He's got my phone in his pants.
He's not going to give you his phone back after you've just augmented and orchestrated his clothes being sent off to a gay massage parlour.
I know.
Although, actually, Trevor, this for you will be, it could be a dating opportunity. Lisa Morris is here, everyone. Let's create some atmosphere. Woo-hoo! Woo! Right, hello, Lisa. Thanks for coming.
You're welcome, Russell. Thanks for having me.
Did you see, you saw Trevor in the street, did you?
I did. It was a complete surprise.
How was he carrying on?
He was...
what was he doing?
You know,
what was
he doing? A bit shady.
Use a verb.
Kind of talking to young girls, basically.
He was talking to young...
Lisa.
Trevor, that was not
but
part of the task.
I wasn't.
Why are we talking to young girls?
I wasn't.
Having photos taken with them.
Oh, Trevor.
I did not talk to them. I was talking
to
someone
else. Yeah, actually, you didn't. You were quite rude to them. You sort of
went, thanks. I was on the phone to that little fella there.
You just went, oh, thanks, and sort of like...
Blasé, nonchalant attitude.
Off they went crying.
Really? Yeah. Making person. Children cry.
Yeah.
Did you not do any dancing?
He didn't do any dancing, no. I'm going to hire him for my daughter's birthday party.
I'd
great.
Keep him away from your daughter's birthday party if I was you, Lisa. I think the last thing any children's party needs is Trevor Locke going around making children cry. He's got 2 17-year-old Italian girls living in absolute dread.
They are
in his
house. Old.
Are they both 18?
We spoke
she turned
to those
18
girls.
On Wednesday.
Thank God. Thank God that she's edging towards adulthood and keeping you potentially out of jail. We've also got Xanthi here, who's known as Cookie Girl. Create atmosphere for Cookie Girl, yes!
Hello.
Hello, Xanthi.
Hi, Russell.
So, why Trevor organised you coming, did he?
He did, yeah.
On what grounds?
To bring cookies for you all.
Why? Well, how did he justify it?
He didn't really justify it.
Well, let's just explain to people that are deprived of visual medium. Xanthi is sexually attractive. She's a sexually attractive woman.
Look, I have a mid-morning sugar dip around about 11:30.
The mid-morning sugar dip is how Trevor describes coating his genitals in sherbet. That's what he calls his mid-morning sugar dip. You're a sick and twisted individual. Xanthi, you've been brought here. It's lovely to have you here.
I have straddled. Trevor before you.
Well, be careful.
Quite nightly for about a month.
What?
I think.
What's going on? What exactly is happening
we,
here?
We did a play together. We worked together.
Oh,
in
really?
Edinburgh, yeah.
You know, one of those.
You did write
it
was,
he wrote
plays.
It. Yeah, he did write the play and cast the play.
I've been in one of
and direct
plays.
It.
Yeah, I know. That's why it's essentially live pornography. if it appeared on the streets of Patpong, Bangkok, I think the local residence committee would have got together to have it banned. Trevor's plays are essentially one man's decadent fantasies marching across stage, make the work of the Marquis de Sade look jaded, tired and inhibited. Xanthi, thank you for coming. So can I have
would
a cookie
like
then?
A cookie, yeah.
I'd love a cookie.
Okay, there's milk, Belgian chocolate.
I love that
yep,
one.
Go for that one. Anyone
thank
else?
One, please.
Yeah. Really nice. Okay, so let's wrap up. We need to get some entries for Trevor's Sonic Enigma brought into this studio, please. There's
cookies.
Oh, have a listen to this song and see what it inspires in you. This might be interesting. Now, we're doing Trevor's Sonic Enigma. How are you feeling, Trev? Why do you look so listless and miserable and unhappy? I've never seen anyone look so miserable in a tutu before, except perhaps the vicar in Morris's song.
I just think that, you know, you're going a little bit too far.
What with? What have we gone too far with?
Well, you're just picking on me in a ridiculous way now I've got to go to Shoreditch. I have a day off. I never have a day off. Yesterday was my day off. I had to ferry those Italian girls to FedEx.
You didn't have to do that, Trev.
Do the thing with
what
my
was,
bottom.
Why were you ferrying them to FedEx? Because you'd murdered them. Was it their corpses that you were taking to FedEx?
Because it was a thing I had to pick up. And then...
What's this thing? What's going on with these Italian girls? You shouldn't
thing?
Be allowed to have Italian girls
they
living in these house.
Food parcels sent
look at
in
you,
by
you're
their
sat
parents,
there, you're a transvestite, you've got teenage girls living in your house, you're going now to a gay massage parlour, and you've got children living in your house. Let's get their parents on the phone in Italy. Who speaks Italian? This is an outrage. Matt, I'm worried. Are you worried about the way he's living?
I'm deeply concerned.
Cookie Girl's just been sicking her own cookies. Lisa Morris looks destitute. I've never seen it like this. Okay, so we're trying to wrap up Trevor's Sonic Enigma. Let's tell you something. Every single person that entered the competition got it right.
However, every single person in this room didn't get it right.
Except last week's competition winners, Chris and Steve, they got it right.
Which
didn't
is ironic because last week they didn't actually get the competition right, they had to Google the answer.
You cheat!
They just confessed
you
to
dirty cheats! Yeah. Oh, you are the Sonic Enigma equivalent of OJ Simpson. I just hope you don't get away with it. Not that he was guilty.
They went to www.cheatsonicenigma.com and found out the answer.
Trevor, again, talking of the Enigma as if it's a cultural phenomenon. As if it exists independently of him, as if it's a Siamese twin.
It does it
sucking
exist
out
independently
his
of me.
Trevor, you don't even exist independently. There's a right. So right, we've got Jessica on the line. She is a person that we believe has got the right answer. There seems little point in playing the Enigma again, as every one of our listeners already knows the answer. Jessica, hello.
Hello, Russell. I'm really sorry to correct you, but I'm Jacqueline.
Jacqueline, I'm very sorry for getting your name wrong. How are you, dear?
I'm very well, thank you.
Have you been enjoying our radio programme that we make today?
I love your radio programme. I listen to it on Sunday mornings every week.
It's good to do that. Just listen to the podcast as well, because we're trying to get to the top of the charts, as a matter of fact. It's
I haven't done that. I will try that.
There's extra bits on the podcast. Sometimes Trevor is a lot more honest about his relationship with those Italian girls, for example. The Italian police are now in possession of podcasts number 7 and 8 and are scrutinising it.
Well, I shall have to listen to that.
Yeah, you ought to. It's interesting stuff. So you think you know the answer to the enigma?
I think I do.
Have you ever got an enigma right before?
Yes, I have. I got the Beatles one about the bathroom window.
Oh, yes, of course. Trevor, would you like to say hello to Jacqueline?
No.
Why? What's wrong with you?
Because it's a convention, it's a cliche. Why should I say hello to people just because you say, would you like to say hello to someone? I mean, that makes me feel like a child.
I'll tell you what it is, Trev. It's being polite to people. It's not had the common courtesy
it's not polite,
to
it's
enter
not
your ridiculous contest.
Meet? Yes, we are next
you
week.
You are. Are you going to come right? If Jacqueline gets it right, and we know that she has got it right, because everyone who enters the competition has got it right.
When it means something.
Be in London, though.
Say hello to her in the flesh. It sounds like you're going to shout into her bottom, which wouldn't surprise me, looking at the way you're dressed, you disgusting animal.
Well, maybe I will shout into her bottom, and maybe it'll echo back. Me.
I think what it would probably echo back is that you are a pervert. Stop
maybe
leaning
the
on your microphone.
Primitive man on the wall.
Stop leaning on your microphone like that. You're not a Ramone. Let go of it.
I will not let go of my microphone. The way I choose to use my microphone technique is up to me. Don't you bully me any further.
Oh, are you standing up to me, Trevor?
I am literally
standing up in a tutu. What a ridiculous
what,
sight. Oh, he's flashing.
That masculinity.
Matthew's phone is half ingested into Trevor. It looks like it's scurrying to freedom. Matthew, we'll get you another phone on expenses.
His, they shouldn't have swear with that. Masculinity is going to work really well when you get to the old massage.
Yeah, yeah, it is. Yeah, Trev, they're going to love that gear down there.
Give me my clothes. I want my clothes. I'm a man. I'm a real man in a tutu with easy access to all of my orifices, and I want to be treated with respect.
Trev, can I have my phone? I've got to go.
Trevor, stop touching the microphone. Trevor, stop touching the microphone. It's making a terrible din on air. Let go of it. It's a technical
if
problem.
If I let go of it now, it's going to crash.
I'll tell you what will crash is your career if you don't start listening to the people that are instructing you.
If there are any of Matt Morgan's friends listening, please ring his phone now.
You dirty animal.
Because I'm hoping he switched it to vibrate.
Oh, Trevor,
sit on it like that.
Where
is it in your knickers?
You're never getting that back, Matt. Not after you had that colonic yesterday. He's all open, gaping, and ready to take calls. That's Trevor Locke. I'm sorry, but, you know, that's the truth. Jacqueline, what's the answer to the Sonic Enigma, my dear?
Okay, the answer is there's this guy works down the chip shop to Where's His Elvis by Kirsty MacArthur.
Is that the right answer, Trevor?
Well, of course it is, otherwise she wouldn't be on air, would she?
Well done, let's create atmosphere! Correct answer, yes! Alright, we're all alive at the same time. Humanity, hooray for humanity. But, you know, we could have given it to Nick Godkin. We could have given it to Alan in Plymouth. We could have given it to someone in Liverpool. We could have given it to Dale Priestley. Jacqueline, we did give it to you. There's a countless correct answer. Not one wrong answer, Trevor.
Well, there we are.
So you're
people
Sonic
are beginning
Enigma.
To get on my wavelength, aren't they?
I think what you're
beginning to win over the country.
Your Sonic platitude.
Oh, it's vibrating.
Is it really?
Oh, yeah.
Someone's ringing it. Oh,
it was a text.
Animal.
It was a text.
Let's just hope no one rings it. Trevor, if anyone...
Read that.
If someone rings that phone, you're paying for the dry cleaning of the tutu. Let me tell you, okay?
Oh, this is disgusting.
It's immoral. It's amoral.
I
it's disgusting.
I liked him when we were bullying him and my phone wasn't involved.
Yeah, no, it's terrible.
I shouldn't have given it to him.
You should never have given him your phone.
Where
never trust
it?
Trevor
Locke. Is it front or back?
It's in him.
Front, isn't it? Oh, another one. That's nice.
Oh, Christ. Okay, listen. Let's listen. We're going to listen to the Pipettes. Probably the Pipettes.
Yeah.
Oh, Jacqueline, thanks, darling. Well done. Congratulations.
Thanks.
Brilliant
thanks.
Contribution.
Well
are you coming
done.
In
well
next
done,
week, Jacqueline?
Yeah, I'm really looking forward to it.
Bring some people in. And when I say people, I mean protection, because Trevor Locke is usually overly amorous with competition. He considers them his prey. He's got the same attitude to competition winners that Fred West had to his daughters. Thank you very much, Jacqueline. Okay,
thank
so
you.
I'll tell you what. Let's listen to the Pipettes, other people that Trevor has terrified and stalked. Then we're going to have a bit more of a chat to Lisa Morris. Who knows what the cookie girl's going to do? Let's ring up Noel. We had a little chat to Noel earlier. We're ringing back. We've got Matt Morgan's cultural review. Yes. You went to an opera, didn't you, Matt?
Yeah, and I don't speak like that.
I went to the opera. This is what I've done. I'm some effing opera. I stuck something out of my bum.
Let's have a listen to the Pipettes. But first, a little trail, I believe.
6 Music.
That there was the Pipettes, Paul Shapes. The Pipettes who won't be coming into the Russell Brand Show on 6 Music with Trevor Locke and Matt Morgan. Why, Trevor?
Because they've got something better to do with their tour.
They value their sexual dignity. That's why, Trevor, and they don't want to come in here and be lunged at by a man in a tutu who is even now plotting his route to a gay massage parlour.
How many texts
not attacking
have I had?
Homosexual lifestyles, we're attacking Trevor Locke.
How many texts have I had?
You've had 2 texts and...
Give Matt his phone back, you pervert.
Luckily they came through in Braille.
Sick animal. What's wrong with you? What's wrong with this man?
Nothing is wrong with me. It's the way you treat me.
Lisa, come up to the mic. Step up to the mic, baby. We're talking about love. What was your first love, Lisa?
My first love?
Yeah.
As in a personal
thing?
Didn't
you used to get picked up from school by a bros?
No, not quite.
Well,
no.
Tell us about
I
that.
I met them
at
a junior
from?
Best disco at the Hippodrome when I was about 15.
What were you doing at a disco when you were 15?
Well, I used to go to all sorts of places when I was 15.
Did you?
I used to dress up like Sade, put red lipstick on high heels and grease my hair back and
go out to... Off you go.
Pubs, yeah, clubs, you know. But it was a junior best disco. It was for teenagers.
What were bros doing there?
They were performing.
Oh, right, fair enough.
Mm. Well, they never picked me up from school.
And they, did you have a relationship
that's
with one of them?
Completely false. No, I didn't, you cheeky shit.
Trevor!
Boy, that's just a question.
Why, what an accusation.
How dare you!
You misogynist, woman-hating, ballet dress-wearing, spiteful man.
You just said, what's your first love? Didn't you go out with Bros or something? You said, no, I was in junior
No, he
thing.
Said, no, but then he then said, did Bros used to pick you up from school?
I thought it was a different, it was unrelated subject.
Unrelated to love, actually.
Why did you get to picking up from school?
Because I just looked at Lisa and I sort of thought, oh, imagine Bros picking her up from school, and then I said it. That's how my brain works.
Right, well then you should have sworn at him, not me.
Hey,
sorry.
Listen, I'm not attacking Lisa.
Neither
so who was your first love?
Who was my first love?
Yeah, what was your first experience of love?
A boy called Stephen Morton, and he kissed. I remember him kissing another girl. I remember slapping him around the face. We were at 5
because of envy.
Something else. Yeah. I was devastated.
It's hard, isn't it, love at that age?
It was quite hard.
Well, the Maltese, you know. Oh, with anything of woman born.
Who's the Maltese?
Lisa's the boy that I liked, the first love.
You're not Maltese.
No, I'm not, no.
Okay. But you're quite aggressive.
What, do you want to do a race attack now?
No. Well, I'm just trying to work out why she slapped this little kid.
What? She kissed another
girl.
Just
saying
What's that
you...
got to do with being Maltese? Maltese people don't go around slapping people,
Trevor.
What are you suggesting?
I was being really nice about you just now, saying you reminded me of the girl from the Pipettes, which is no insult to her. He looks quite cute, but I'll take that back now.
What?
You can't take that back.
He looks
that's
a bit like her.
He does know he's wearing a tutu.
And she's beautiful.
We've been trying to get the Pipettes to come in here. They're terrified to come in because of Trevor.
Are they scared of Trevor? I think they should be as well now.
How many of
No,
there.
They shouldn't.
Three, isn't it? How many Pipettes are there? 4.
3.
Four.
And then there's the men
three
that
girls
make the music.
And then the boys.
Then there's the men that make the music.
Yeah.
You sexist hater of all things female.
Do you know what our competition winner said of them?
Go
he
on.
Said it's, they sound like... What, say it. Go to the microphone and say what...
Trevor, look, don't talk to people like that.
I'm quite... No, I just thought it sounded a bit like what would happen if Danny Minogue joined Steps, reformed. They do sound a bit like that.
I think
sorry.
Good.
I like them.
Blimey. Yeah. What an attack. Eat cookie girl was just eating the sick that she'd done into a cookie basket.
That's really harsh. They're my mates. I might have to kick you on their behalf.
Are they your mates?
What would they want me to do, do you think?
I think they wanted to kick Trev right in the nuts.
My phone.
It was
my phone. That's right about his phone getting kicked.
Yeah, actually, do it. I'll be invulnerable.
You're not invulnerable, Trevor.
Trevor, you've sweated on my phone.
You don't know that.
Do you know what? It reminds me of a story. That story of the woman that bought those beady things. Do you know about that?
What?
Some woman went shopping with those beady vibrating things upper. And she,
upper?
And
Lisa?
She went, no, but it was awful because she passed out and they called an ambulance. I think she fell in the freezer compartment.
Well, because the orgasm was so intense,
yeah.
She passed out.
Yeah.
I get a lot of that.
And they discovered.
Matthew, what are you doing?
Trevor's phone is now in my pants.
You're used to. Listen, I thought we were going to try and raise the cultural tone of this show, and the way you two have got used to, oh Russell, you're too scatological. Oh Russell, me, who mentions things like on this show, I've mentioned Brecht, Dostoevsky, all sorts of references I'm using. You two are content to stuff phones up yourselves like a Premiership footballer who shall remain nameless. So listen, then let's do. Should we do Matt's cultural review?
What now?
Well, when are we going to do? We just
let's
tried to ring
to
Noel.
Trail,
we went through
least.
Noel's answer phone. Right, let's listen to the trail that Matt's made for his cultural review.
Okay, let's.
Matt does a cultural review where he...
Hello, this is Matthew Morgan's cultural review. Thank you.
Right, now I'll do one.
No, hang on, I've done that well enough.
I've done that well enough.
Speak like that. Oh, hang on, where's my notes?
Well, you've got notes on your cultural review.
Oh, yeah.
Maybe they're down my pants.
Trevor, what's wrong with you? Your pants are like Pandora's box. Just all the evils of the world are stuffed down there. Even before today's shows, they had your genitals down them, and that was a terrible place to start. Crikey. Okay, so let's have a little bit. Should we have some music before we do Matt's cultural review?
Yeah, I need to prepare for it.
We're going to listen to System of a Down, Chop Suey. Oh, blimey, there's going to be some energy on tonight. Right, remember, like, that you can win these tickets for that Sunday thing, Summer Sunday. We've got someone who sent us this really brilliant email going, remember we said to win it, you want to ring us up and go, I'm Trevor Lott, or whatever it was we were on about then.
No.
Well, we said something like that.
It wasn't that.
Stop leaning on that mic, Trevor. Never do it again. Crikey. So, so we've got someone here. I'm a guillemot. They've sent that. They've sent a picture of a guillemot. So this person, and then a description of guillemots. I'm penguin-like in appearance, slim, pointed bill, dark brown head, and upper parts white, underparts lower, face is white. This is a good description of a guillemot, essentially. And it's her name is Hannah, and she's on the phone now. You're right, Hannah.
Yeah, I'm fine, thanks.
Oh, you're young, are you?
I'm 15.
Oh, to be 15. Mind you, I was depressed and suicidal and obsessed with self-harming. Hopefully, you're probably a bit... you might be a bit more upbeat.
Yeah.
You sound well balanced. Good to be you. So, you've won this thing, then.
Brilliant.
You can enjoy that. What is Summer Sunday, then? It's got those people playing, isn't it?
Yeah.
By Richard Matthews.
Yeah.
That's good. How come you... what did you think? You listened to the show and you thought, right, I'll recreate that sound that they were making.
Oh, right,
Is that what, why? Because you've typed out the word caw, caw. It's good, quite well phonetically represented, in my view.
Thank you.
You've done a good job. Right, so from the perspective of a 15-year-old girl, what do you make of the show, Hannah?
I absolutely love it.
Do you?
Yeah, you read out my email on the show last week.
Which one was that, darling?
Challenge Trevor, about the tent and that.
About the tent? Yeah. Making him live in a tent in the studio, was it?
Yeah, with the gravel and the pictures.
Yeah, that was a good suggestion.
That was a good suggestion.
What did you think about us making him go out into the street and ballet dance and all that?
I think it's cruel, but he deserves it, doesn't he?
It's cruel, but he deserves it.
Why do you think I deserve it? Seriously, look into your heart and give me a serious, sensible response. Why do I deserve that?
To be honest, Trevor, I don't really know. Your sonic enigma's a bit rubbish, though, isn't it?
Yes, well done, Hannah. You're the voice of reason. It took a 15-year-old out of the mouths of babes, Trevor. Look, that woman has named you as an incompetent goon. Quite rightly, needed doing. Hannah, so you've got that lovely prize. You can come down to studio, bring an adult, because, you know about Trevor Locke's reputation, I'm sure. He's dangerous.
Okay.
It's tiresome. It's really tiresome.
It's not
really
tiresome, Trevor.
Studio?
Of course you can. Where do you live?
Brilliant.
Where do you live, love?
Lincolnshire.
Yeah, bring your mum and dad or whoever looks after you. Come down here.
I was born in Lincoln.
Brilliant.
Call it born, Trevor. You were more created in a petri dish by a pervert. So, Hannah, come down next week. Bring some adults with you, though,
my
love.
All right, I will do.
All right, hon. Listen, your enthusiasm is joyous. Get people to listen to the podcast because we're trying to get it to number one. So when we get to number one, I'll have a special
party. I blatantly advertised it on my MySpace.
Well done, hon. You're an angel.
Thank you.
Thanks for the call, Hannah. Sweetheart. Stay on the line and talk to a producer because then you can sort out coming down here.
Okay, thanks.
Right, bye, Treasure. Take care, love. Right, okay, then what are we going to listen to now?
A trail about something.
Ooh, exciting.
Mystery.
Then we'll listen to some music. Oh, we're going to listen to Trevor's Sonic Enigma song.
And then a bit of Zappa.
Oh, a bit of Zappa today.
We don't really need to listen to that Kirsty MacColl song, do we?
What do you mean?
That's up to you. I don't care.
I don't know. I've never heard it.
I don't know. Have a vote.
Trevor.
Trev! Your sonic enigmas are a lie. Yeah. That was an innocent child that you've enchanted, that you've gone to your spell like Pied Piper in a tutu. And I nearly said Pied Pampers because I think what you've done in that tutu is disgusting. Matt's phone may never work again.
No, we've got our phone. We've swapped our phones.
We've done a phone amnesty.
No, I know. It's a joke. Frank Zappa, that was good, wasn't it?
Brilliant. I love
the slime from your radio.
I am the slime.
Very honest of you to admit that, Matt. What are you saying, Trev?
I'm just saying it's very apposite, that title, isn't it?
Yeah, fade it out because otherwise we won't be able to use this in the podcast. What is apposite, you say?
It's apposite that we're playing slime from the radio, isn't it?
Well, it is from your perspective, Trevor. What we do is create art. What you do is create very nervous parents of teenage daughters somewhere in Milan, I would imagine.
You've ruined my Sunday afternoon.
You
have. One day off.
You've ruined that
it
for yourself,
you
Trevor.
It won't take
you long
to get there.
Well, it's not going to take you long.
Unless you get caught up in that massage parlour for some reason, Trev. Unless for some reason a visit to a massage parlour should start to consume your day. If you should start to look at it as part of your leisure time, your pleasure time, your little bottom treasure time.
You could take off the puffball skirt to drive.
I will take
off
the puffball skirt.
Don't let him. Let's make him go there dressed like that. He's going to look nice, I think.
ID. Do I have any ID? Has my bag been ferried there? I don't
know. Has my bag been ferried there? I just don't know.
Trev, it's character building.
It's good for you, this, Trev, because you should have had a little stint in the army instead of laying in your bed coughing throughout your childhood like a wheezing little Nancy boy. Look at your little face. Do you love me, mate?
I do, sometimes.
Well, what about this time?
I didn't love you last night when I was on that sofa listening to those sounds, clutching your cat for warmth.
You shouldn't have been. The sounds were probably coming from the cat. He was off his food this morning. As if he were, poor thing, gargling, foaming, rabid, but somehow suspicious.
You set the clock to the wrong time in your house to disorient people deliberately.
It's like a crazy dolly-esque theme park in there.
You say, Russell, what, your clock's about 40 minutes fast. He goes, yeah, I do that so I'm never late, which he always is late.
It's good, because time's an irrelevance. Time's a redundant concept. If you want to be chained to these ideas, man, that's up to you.
Yeah, but when you're sitting outside your house in a taxi, waiting for you, ringing your bell and phoning you, it's not irrelevant.
Okay, I'm very sorry real. About that. I've tried to be a good friend. Do your cultural review!
What a nice way to throw to it.
Do a review! Review culture!
Mark Commode would never be treated like that. You're
Do that thing! You're like Mark Commode prince, you are.
Do you think so?
He's absolutely strutting around his pathetic little kingdom.
Because he can't make out with the cookie girl because she's married.
Yeah.
Or in a
I like cookie girl.
She just said to me, I'm not married, and winked at me.
Right! That cookie girl.
She just doesn't find you attractive.
Yeah. You know, some...
Why have I not read about her in the Womanizer review then? Woman found! Impervious to my. Have you got the cab driver, Steph?
Oh,
here he is. Come in, mate. I know, bring him into the studio.
That means my clothes.
Come in, mate!
My clothes
come
haven't
in,
been
mate.
Sent.
Talk to him like
hello,
a gerbil.
Come and stand here, Robbie. My name's Russell. Come right
come
here.
Come and talk to this hello. Microphone.
Have we met before?
Yes.
We had.
Yeah.
Right, now, that gentleman there is Trevor. You see Trevor?
Hello.
Right, now, we would like you to ferry Trevor's clothing.
Where are my clothes?
To chariot. We've been hiding them from you, Trev, because it took longer to administrate than we'd imagined. So, there's a massage parlour called Chariot, and we want you to take these clothes there. Are you all right to do that?
Well, I'm going to take the clothes.
Yeah, don't take Trevor. You'll be taking... Trevor will
just,
be going there
just
later.
Just take some clothes to that massage parlour and leave them on reception, and then he's going to go and get them a bit later, dressed like that.
Okay.
Yeah, look how he's dressed. It's going to be embarrassing for him, isn't it?
Yes, it is, yeah.
Yes, it is. What's your name, mate?
Shahid.
Shahid, I'm Russell. Yeah, we've met before, haven't we?
Yeah.
Yeah, so, this is a cookie girl. She's attractive, isn't she? Perhaps you'd like to give Shahid a cookie.
Ah, that's
very kind of you.
Thank you.
Lisa, this is Lisa. Lisa, this is Shahid.
Hello.
Competition winners. This is our resident poet, Mr. G. That's Matt Morgan, Fizz Avatar, Adam producer. Hello. Competition winners, Chris Hello. And Steve. Yeah, that's Matt.
How do you know that the massage parlour has a reception?
Huh?
How do you know that this place has a reception?
You can't just wander in.
It's going to be a reception.
You think it's going to be a reception?
Of course there's going to be a reception. There's going to be a big reception for you, mate. You'll get a 21-gun salute, I reckon. You could be blinded by your reception, sunshine. Dear old Trevor. Yeah, I think we'll have an opportunity to find out how he would cope with prison life, something that Matt was speculating on earlier. But anyway, time for you stay here with us, Shahid.
Okay.
Matt. Because
nice then trouble will stop him going.
No, he won't. All right, let's give him a minute. Take these clothes. Take them to Chariot's massage parlour. Steph out there will give you the precise address. If they seem suspicious at Chariot's, well, that's because they are. So,
have you been there before?
We accidentally, well...
Accidentally.
We were next door. We were next door. There used to be a brothel next door to it.
Oh, I see. You were
and Matt went
though,
to.
So yes, but can I just say...
I wasn't going because I was scared of sex.
I'm not scared of sex. I just want to have sex with a prostitute.
Sit there you gutless little coward.
Wait for you. And you didn't even have the balls to do it. You came running downstairs nearly crying.
She was unattractive. She looked just like a bulldog out of Tom and Jerry. She was frightening me. Right, okay. She was no, it's nothing. Anyway, that was when I was on drugs and I didn't know about prostitution being wrong then. So I was confused. Now I know that things like that is wrong. It's bad for women.
Shahid, could
and
you just go through my pockets?
I've done that already. Shahid, take those off to Chariot's gay massage parlour. And don't spare the horses, my good man.
Thank you, Shahid.
Tell them that a man in a pink tutu will be there to pick it up later.
Yeah. What, where are they?
Pardon?
You'll get the address in a minute, Shahid. Don't worry about the details. We're just good at the bigger picture. Round of applause for Shahid, he's a hero! Come up the man! Alright. Okay, let's have Matt's cultural review, where Matt Morgan, the very antithesis of culture, reviews it. What did you do this week, Matt?
This week, I went and saw Turandot, and that's how you pronounce it, even though it looks like it should be said Turando, with a lady.
Yeah, because I overheard you. You're using this cultural review as a womanising tool.
Well, of course.
Yes, you are, aren't you? Disgusting.
I have to go somewhere every... Like, I went twice on my own to things.
No, you went with a bloke. Oh, yeah,
I went once on my own,
friend.
Once with a mate.
Butch friend.
This week...
Do you want to go with Trevor to Chariots, do you?
No.
Hmm.
Of course I don't. Probably going to the opera with a young
probably
lady.
When you got there, go, Mr. Morgan, would you like your usual table? Will it just be a rub down today, sir?
I don't think they have tables there.
Yeah. I don't know what goes on out, would I? Not that there's anything wrong with it, as we all know.
So that was the cultural review. Very nice.
Come on then, what was Well, you went to Turandot with a girl. You used it, where was it? Royal Opera House?
Yeah, it was lovely.
Nice there,
really
was it?
Nice, yeah.
So what was the opera like? Come on in, review culture. You wanted a cultural review.
The story's not very good, but
what happens?
The music's, like, Nessun Dorma is the classic song that's in it.
That's good.
You have to wait for that for ages, and then when it happens, it's only a little bit.
It's not that long.
And then there's an interval, and then they do a little bit more of it, and then it's gone.
Break it up. They don't present it very well.
I wanted opera's greatest hits on
that
stage.
But there are other nice ones, aren't there?
Well, yeah.
Yeah.
It's a lot of madness. Because you have to read the subtitles on a screen above the action.
Yeah.
So if you... I kept... forgetting about that, thinking, oh, look at that man's mask, and then getting sucked in and not knowing then what was going on. The girl I was with turned to me at one point and goes, oh, it's so sad, isn't it? I didn't know what was going on.
Yeah. She's probably saying it's so sad to be trapped in an opera house with a yobbo. What did you wear?
I wore a shirt.
What do you mean?
Just a
leather
shirt.
Jacket, shirt. I looked cool.
Yeah. You did not
I didn't,
cool.
I did dress up first and with proper shoes and a shirt, and I thought, nah.
What,
I
you felt too shy to dress up?
People don't dress up that much there. There's a lot of mad old people bumbling around there.
Matthew, them people deserve our, at very least, our respect.
I'll respect them.
Where did you nice. Sit? Which seats did you have?
Pretty good on the... Oh, yeah, I've got something to say about this, right? I've got an idea.
This is rubbish. You told me this earlier.
On the stalls.
That's brilliant. Those are really
bottom,
good seats.
You know, on the circle, the lowest circle.
Yeah, yeah.
Quite, you know, really
I've only
good
ever
seats.
Sat there twice.
Yeah, probably. Well, were you banned the second time?
No, but it's just difficult to get.
What happened? Did you ruin the second seat with effluvia? Did you leave someone's plasma coated phone?
The opera is expensive. Those seats probably cost about £70 there.
Yeah.
All right. So
the next time I use it as a womanizing tool, I'm not going to say it's for. I'm just going to say I've booked some tickets.
Yeah,
don't discuss your predatory behaviour on our radio show.
Do you want to hear my idea?
Go on, Lisa Morris.
Go on, what's your idea?
I had to sit at one side of the stage with my head craned round for like 3 hours,
yeah,
going one way. And I reckon, and obviously the place is symmetrical, right?
Mm.
So I reckon you should get a ticket with a numbered seat, which is on one side, and you watch half of it with your head one
Brilliant.
Way. Then your number, it corresponds to the seat on the other side, and you watch the next half with your neck pointing the other way, because I came out of there with a sore neck.
Difficult to administer.
Trevor sees
well.
That's brilliant.
It's fun thing
it
to do.
Easier to just and ban you from the opera.
There could be a twinning thing, maybe sort of a dating service
twinning.
With the person that's got your ticket on the other side of the auditorium. And you,
and
could
you
be,
go, yeah.
Trevor,
you
how typical of you to try and turn the Royal Opera House into a place for cottaging? Perhaps I should have a glory hole in the lavvies at the Royal Opera House. Would you like that as well?
It was a sensible idea.
Trevor, why don't you save these ideas for Chariots? Yeah? Get it off your chest there.
It's a tenner for a plate of sandwiches.
It's a tenner for a plate of sandwiches. That's reasonable. Are they nice sandwiches?
Yeah, they're nice.
What a great cultural review. Matthew, have you feel you've sufficiently reviewed culture this week?
Well, not really. I think, you know...
Well, what other points have you got to raise?
The story or the music?
Well, it's too much, isn't it? You're clearly a fish out of water.
Well, the final word is, it's good.
It's good.
It's a nice thing to
do. There we go. We can recommend to our listeners that they go and see Turandot at the Royal Opera House. All right, it's happy now. Right, so we're going to do Mr. G now, straight away. Right, yeah. Mr. G's here, he's going to do a poem surmising the entire show. Yeah, all right. You all right, mate?
Yeah, I'm good.
Have you enjoyed the show this week?
Yep, I've enjoyed the tutu, I've enjoyed the cookies.
Yeah, it's been all right, hasn't it?
We're getting treated. The cookies were really good.
The cookies were a treat. It's just a shame that some of us couldn't behave professionally around the cookie girl and let our animal instincts get the better of us.
I say, speaking for yourself as usual.
I'm speaking for Trevor Locke. Who's made a pink wigwam of his ballet tights? Okay, so let's
phone.
Let's hear a
okay,
poem
this
then,
poem
mate.
Is on first love. She was the most beautiful sight that I'd ever seen. My eyes would boast total delight and revel in her gleam. I had fantasies of the ecstatic that plagued my mind with erratic thoughts of how to inhabit her space and time. Love, the stuff that dreams are made of. Trevor sees it as a mental illness that causes car crashes in the fog. Matt compared it to colonic irrigation, an empty feeling that leaves you aching, while Russell exposed his mangled manhood to show us the pain of modern dating.
Oi!
Love can have some people love can have some people dancing in the street, sporting a pink tutu and ballet shoes complete. But for me, it's a feeling that's unique for a special person that you're destined to meet. For nothing can compare to that first feeling of love. It's the stuff that dreams are made of which none of us can ever seem to get enough. Love.
Mr. J, beautiful poem! And I'll tell you what seems incredibly apposite to me is that I actually think I've fallen in love with Cookie Girl.
I think G did that poem partly to make her love him.
Right!
I suppose try our best.
G, you've got a relationship. You've got your sex life's complicated enough, the anecdotes I listen to, you poor sod. Right, okay, so should we wrap up the show? Right, this is the end of the show now. We've got no more time, so we're going to throw it through. What a show it's been, though, Trev. Have you enjoyed it?
No, I haven't.
It's not over for you. Not over by a long chalk. Trevor, you better get yourself some recording device so I want to hear what goes on in that chariot.
Well, if at any point... Why don't you come with me?
I'm not going there.
Yes, you are. You're coming with me.
You've got a photographer lady. She can go with you.
Oh, yeah, that's not going to cause a problem in a gay massage parlour. For Christ's sake,
you guys are coming with me.
I'm not. I've got a very important family.
I'm busy. Me and Cookie Girl are going out. We're busy, Trev. People have moved on. You've got to let the show go.
Kind to you yesterday. I don't have any...
How are you kind to me?
I've left my wallet at home. I would have gone home and got my wallet yesterday. I didn't. I ferried you around London and the east of England and then back home again. Slept on your sofa. I haven't washed. I haven't brushed my teeth.
And this is... How is this kind to me? You sound just like you stank out my sofa. You're an unwelcome guest. It's like having Oscar the Grouch in my living room this morning. The cat's never been the same. I don't see how I've benefited from this. Let's have a round of applause to everyone that's contributing to the show. Lisa Morris! Cookie Girl, I want you know, that was a Cookie Monster, Sesame Street. I feel like that guy. And of course, Steve and Chris, our competition winners. It's going to be another fantastic show next week. Let's get our podcast to number one. Keep downloading our podcast, everyone. We've got to roar to the top. What are we going to play it on? Kirsty McCall.
This is the track that Trevor
for Trevor's Sonic
he's
Enigma.
Never even heard.
Trevor's never even heard it. Everyone got it. See you next week. We won't see you. It's radio. Listen to us talking. Boy, I love you.
Goodbye.
That was just the podcast. Wasn't it real neat?
Yes, we've decided we're going to buy a football and go and play in the park.
It's good, isn't it, to do a bit of exercise? I think we really gelled as a side there when we were playing.
We were pretty good, weren't we?
We're playing football in the BBC offices. There's a BBC, there's a floor at the BBC. It's got no people in it or no chairs. It's a waste of your licence payers' money. But we did play football there.
Instead of a carpet, it's got little goals.
Yeah.
Little cardboard cutout.
Madness indoors.
It's wild, man.
It's really spooky.
It's like Willy Wonka's chocolate factory, man, but with its feet on backwards and with a hard, stiff winkle, baby. Yes.
Don't keep talking about the winkles.
Why not?
Because we were going to do a whole show this Sunday without a mention of a winkle.
Do you reckon we'll be able to do it, Trev?
Just squeaked it out in the end of the necklace? Podcast.
Because I like Dior.
Let me have a look at it. Is this the thing with the flag on it?
Yeah.
Why have you always got that at the front?
Grabbing it. Because I like it with that at the front. It gives like it another facet. I've got this necklace on. One bit's a Union Jack. The back bit's got this little sort of tag bit.
The other
if
bit
I wore
is
that
a plug
necklace,
you'd
go, Matt, you've got a Union Jack necklace. You're a yob.
I would, actually, because if you wore it, it would mean that. But me wearing it, it's ironic and nice.
You disgust me. You're a West Ham fan. I don't even like football.
Yeah, but I never allowed it to creep into racism. I just judge people on whether or not they've got big boobs. Right, okay. That was the podcast. Got anything to add, Trev?
No, I'm ashamed.
I say you should be, Trevor. You've got two 17-year-old girls that you live with, and quite frankly, you're ruining their childhood.
One of them is 18, and the other one will turn 18 before this podcast
is
produced.
Yeah, but what would be nice is
the insides of old women.
They have. Both of them have got your ugly little babies growing in their bowels.
Don't be silly. You can't keep saying that.
Have you snogged any of them?
No.
He has, Matt.
I haven't. I don't snog anyone.
I'm going round. I'm going to examine those girls.
Why can't me and Russell go out for
fun? Yeah, why can't we, Trev?
Young.
He endeth the podcast outro.
Bye then, love who? Do you love him?
I do.
Well done.
I'm shy though.
Good to love people. Thanks for downloading this trial from the BBC. Find out more at bbc.co.uk/6music. BBC 6 Music. Hold on.
A lot of stuff came out of you, didn't it?
Loads. I think it really felt good for me.
Yeah.
Carrying a lot of nonsense, probably because all them years of drug addiction, I must have clogged up myself with all sorts of junk.
And I think there's emotional stuff in there. That's
emotional
stuff.
The
woman said that it cleans you out emotionally as well, didn't she?
Yeah, she said you could burst into tears at the end.
Yeah, well, I burst into tears at the beginning, at the point of penetration. Boy, I missed my suppositories that day. There's a competition here for, incidentally, my bum's in lovely shape. Competition here, Summer Sunday's tickets. You can win a pair of tickets, to go to Summer Sunday, but spelt like an ice cream sundae, which is, that's in Leicester on the 11th to the 13th. You can see people like Richard Hawley, Elbow, The Young Knives, Cold Cut and Bell and Sebastian. Six Music are doing loads of live shows from that festival. If you want to know more, go to our website. Or what have you got to do? You've got to guess what a sun track is. Is that what you've got to do? What have you got to do, Adam? You just tell me.
I know what to do.
Tell us then, Trev.
I know what to do. If you hear the guillemots being played,
yeah,
you must behave like a guillemot, which is a seagull that is resident to these islands, and ring us up and do the sound a guillemot makes when it nests. And then if you get that right... Not that. That's when it's mating, probably.
Ah, Trevor! Get off me!
That's it.
I didn't consent to that! Get off my bum feathers!
That's it. If you do that, then you get tickets to
Get off my bum feathers!
Then
you can have tickets to this event, Summer Sunday, 11th to the 13th of August, Richard Hawley Elbow and all that stuff.
What an eccentric competition.
It is an eccentric
Sounds
competition.
Like a good one. So if you listen out for the guillemots, if those guys should crop up, then give us a bell. Right, so, seagulling. Interesting, that should be mentioned, because Noel gave me a ring yesterday asking about seagulling, because I mentioned it on one of the television programmes, because it's this craze that's sweeping the nation, seagulling. Don't worry, we'll ring Noel later.
I think we'll answer that phone.
What is that phone? What's
I think it's a mystery call. It could be from...
No, Gallagher don't know the phone number.
I know.
Let's just ignore it. It's hard.
You can't just answer a phone on radio, Trev.
Oh,
can you? It could be anybody. It could be a nutcase issue. All right, let's do it. Answer the phone then. Let's see who it is.
We've done it how?
Pick it up.
I know. Just lift it up.
Pick it up and put it through the desk. Hello? Hello? Hello?
It's a different line.
Why is it flashing in here? Strange. All right, so there's a challenge for Trevor now. You know we challenge Trevor to do things. Right, here's a challenge from Thompson. Trevor should wet himself on air to make him itchy. What's wrong with that challenge?
Well, it's a puerile thing.
What do you want to do then? Do you think someone's going to ever challenge you? Trevor should live his life according to a Dostoevsky novel, Crime and Punishment.
Something like that.
It's just too difficult to conduct.
The only thing with that is, do you remember when we were naked and all the stink? Well, no.
Stink? I do not recall a stink, mate.
I'm in the hoo-ha about us being
sat. Don't
naked.
Use the word stink to describe hoo-ha or nonsense in conjunction with nudity.
I didn't mention that.
What's that?
Yeah, don't mention that.
What?
We want to raise the tone of this show a little bit.
With Ali.
Crawling around in the gutter.
Ali, who's Ali?
Let's not go there.
Okay.
Ali,
something happened in an alley.
What, last night?
Yes.
Yeah. We went to my mum's 60th birthday last night.
Yeah, it was lovely.
I don't think, I don't remember raising...
I had a boogaloo in the garden.
You did, Trevor, you're a great dancer. Everyone loves you.
Shucks.
So this is a message from Kathleen and Marina. Trevor should dress in a pink tutu and walk down Oxford Street shouting, I'm a godmother. Fairy godmother.
I'm a godmother.
Godmother's funnier.
I'm a godmother. I'm a godmother. Who's going to trust him to instruct their child in the ways of Christianity? Well, actually, Matt and I have organised a surprise for you, ain't we, Matt?
Am I going to be somebody's godmother? I would love to be somebody's godmother.
No, what, Trevor, that'd be ridiculous.
A godfather, then.
You'd indoctrinate that child
I'm
into a terrible
spiritual
lifestyle.
Person.
You're not, Trev. There's nothing spiritual about the way you conduct yourself.
It's not as nice as that.
Just tell him.
I'm just going to be an uncle.
Yeah, tell him.
We've got a tutu. Like, we've bought it. You've got to do the rest of the show dressed in a tutu. Get your clothes off.
I beg your pardon?
Do the rest of the show in a tutu. It's over there.
See
that hanging up there, that tutu?
Actually, the top part just looks like one of my normal shirts.
It does when you all dress up in pink and embarrass
skirt
us.
Doesn't that look like
yeah, put that on, Trev, right?
Okay.
Get your clothes off. You'll be able to have a look at this on the webcam if you're not, we'll put photographs on the webcam so you can look at it another day if you want to.
I'm not walking down.
There's another challenge from you. This is from young Luke. Get some insects from the outside world and then get Trevor to lick them without eating them so he gets the full taste. We're going to do that as well. I think we've got some insects. I think they're ones that are in lollipops, so no actual insects have been harmed.
Okay.
My first love, says Brendan, turned out to be someone who had a gay older brother that he hero worshipped and wanted to find out what it's like to be with a bloke. All right. Ultimately, being used to fuel sibling rivalry, but at the time I was completely in love. It took me 3 years to stop wearing black and listening to low-key music. He's now a journalist in Palm Beach. That's nice. So what, Brendan fell in love with two brothers? Trevor's taken off his clothes now. The photographer's coming. As a youth, I fell in love with Marina from Stingray. She was very vulnerable, especially out of water. The puppet, I think, was based on Ursula Andress, so she had an added bonus. That's from Gary from Langnennock, I think somewhere in Wales. Did you like Maria?
I don't know who she is. I used to fancy
Marina.
Wilma Flintstone or Betty Rubble or one of them.
Betty Rubble?
Betty Rubble was dark-haired, wasn't she, her?
I think it was Wilma and Betty. Yeah, you used to fancy Betty more?
Yeah.
I didn't fancy either of them.
Wilma was always moaning. Betty was more...
She was more fun, wasn't she? Yeah. She's more of a laugh. Trev's getting his tutu on. Oh, Trevor, why don't you do that right by the microphone like a nutcase would if we let them in?
Well, it's just to give them a flavour.
People don't want that kind of flavour, Trevor.
I just bought tickets for the ballet.
And all the irony, Trev. Oh, I just bought tickets to the ballet and now I'm a ballerina. What's next? Nijinsky coming in here and stamping on my throat? I hope so, Trevor. Right, so Trevor's going to be doing the rest of the show.
Racehorse, wasn't it?
It was a ballerina and all. You know perfectly well, Trevor.
This is fun.
Hello, Russell and friends.
Oh, this is nice.
You look nice, Trev.
I tell you what, we should all get these.
Yeah, you do look lovely.
Yeah, we're right behind fantastic. You, Trev.
You look ever so handsome. Nice to see you. Is that our competition winners? They've turned up. Yeah, he looks nice, doesn't he? Lovely. Okay, last week's competition winners are here, so we'll do Trevor's Sonic Enigma in a moment. What's your Leave it, Trevor. Sit down. What's your Sonic Enigma this week?
I can't give that away, otherwise it would ruin the competition.
Have we got the news in a couple of minutes? Adam, is it news coming up?
Yeah, news comes up in 2 minutes. Yeah.
2 minutes.
2 minutes till the news. Yeah. Okay, right, well, so perhaps we should set up your Sonic Enigma.
Well, do you want to hear my trail? I've done a new trail for it.
Why are you doing that ridiculous position?
Look how he's
standing. This is how a ballerina stands.
Ballerinas, what are you standing in first position?
This is second position, actually.
You look ridiculous.
I think it's third base, actually, but, no, it's not.
Trevor, you're having sex with yourself again.
Can you sit down? That's really unnerving.
Yeah, sit down, Trevor.
I don't want to crush my tutu.
Trevor, just sit down. Stop worrying about crushing your tutu.
Don't you reckon I should have been a dancer, Russ? Be honest.
Yeah, because then we wouldn't have to work with you. There are obvious immediate benefits to that idea. So we're going into the news in a minute. Let's hear your trail for your Sonic Enigma this week, Trevor.
Fire it off, baby.
Trevor, why are you talking about Sonic Enigma? He's dancing to it.
This is haunting.
It's haunting. What's that been inspired by? What's that been inspired by, Trevor?
It just came to me. I try not to plan these things. I just go into the studio.
It's clear that you don't plan them because they're absolute junk.
Now, that's the jingle.
That's the jingle?
That is the jingle, yeah.
Trevor? So indulgent. It went on for 20 seconds.
It's a ghostly sound. It's not, doesn't say, it doesn't say, here's a competition on the radio.
It does. If you listen to those lyrics. Yeah, you picked up the tune. It's catchy, isn't it?
It's not catchy, Trevor. It's quite annoying. Let's listen to our trail. Me and Matt done one.
Oh, Bill, I'm terribly worried about little Trevor.
Why? What's the problem, Sulok? What's wrong with our son, Trevorlock?
He's upstairs and he's got all sorts of mental problems. I think one day it might come out in some sort of enigma.
I think it will come out in enigma. I said to you when you were pregnant, let me punch it out now, then we can have it for dinner. But you insisted on birthing the fool. Now he makes enigmas.
Well, we need something to clear up the mice around the village.
I know! We'll raise our son to be a brutal animal killer, shall we, dear?
Oh, do what you like with him. I'm bored of the little twit.
Good, that was, wasn't it, Matt? Yeah. Me and Matt done that. That's how we think of you, Trev. We regard you in that manner.
I've noticed, yeah.
Okay, we won't listen to the actual Sonic Enigma. We'll listen to that after the news, but it's going to be real exciting. But first, let's have a little bit of news to see what's going on in this crazy world of ours. I always regret it when I throw to the news like that, because it's often been a tragedy. So let's do a more sober, here's the bloody news. All right, let's hear Trevor's Sonic Enigma. We played you the trail just now. Here's the enigma itself. Have a listen to it.
All right, mate, cotton chips, please.
Or would you like a satellite or a plate of mushy peas?
No, mate, I'll just have cotton chips, please.
A sausage roll or a pasty or some onions.
Just cotton chips, please, mate.
Oh. Cotton chips.
It's sort of the usual Elvis impression that tends to creep into Trevor's work. Meandering, long, confusing. If you know what track that's referring to, text us 64046, email us russell.6music@bbc.co.uk. What did you make of that, Matt?
Well, obviously the Elvis connection, the overlongness of
the
it.
The rain in the background, that seems to be a near constant
feature. That's
the fat
frying, surely.
That's the fat frying. He uses the same sound effect as he always uses for rain or toilets being flushed and the other junk that he churns out for us. Trevor, can you even begin? Oh, I'm a broken man. Can
I
you
feel like I'm getting a consistency now? I'm weaving into
you're consistently
consistent
rubbish.
Themes.
You are consistently awful at making Sonic Enigmas. There's no doubt
like
about
a
that.
Tapestry. There's motifs that return each.
They're not
week.
Motifs. Don't refer they to are. These things as motifs, Trev. Like the Sonic Enigma is not an artistic movement, all right?
You've seen the way he's put his ballet shoes on?
Yeah, professionally properly. And skillfully, professionally. As if he's done it hundreds of times. Yes. Trevor's dressed as a ballet dancer.
I think I should have been
Trevor,
a ballet dancer.
Pick up your phone, go out onto the streets of London and dance and pass your mobile phone to a person and get them to describe your dancing. If you leave now, we won't have to look at you any longer.
Horrible thing to say.
Go on.
Go on. Go out into the, take your phone, go onto the streets, and then and do a dance and get someone on the street to describe your dancing. We'll
You'll
do
have
it
to
in
give
the next
me
link.
Your phone because my phone is going to die.
Yeah.
give him your phone, Matt. Yeah. Last week's Sonic Enigma winners are here. Come into the studio, lads. Walk through that door. So you just go out into the street and do some dancing.
Okay.
You all right? Okay. He said that. I like the glum acceptance that he's taken. Okay. I'll go out onto the street.
Go outside.
Just go outside. Find someone to describe your dancing.
What's the telephone number? I don't know
what
the telephone number is.
That mic's not.
All right, we'll call you.
We'll call you and put you
through.
How long do you need? 5 minutes?
We've got 5 minutes, Trev. We're going to play a track.
Have you actually done that before, Matt?
Run outside.
It's about time you did, because you look like you're someone who should be doing it.
Get someone who's good and we'll describe what you're doing well.
Right, okay, so last week's Sonic Enigma winners are here. Come to this microphone, chaps. What's your names? Nick and Steve?
Chris and Steve.
Chris and Steve. Speak right into that microphone as if you're the Supremes.
Hello.
The Supremes would not stand distant like that. Your face must be within 6 inches.
Now Trevor's gone, we could use chairs.
Hey, sit
There's
down.
Chairs around, lads. Get chairs.
Sit yourself down. Yeah. What was the Sonic Enigma that you answered correctly?
It was Pull Shapes by the Pipettes.
Oh, yes, well done. Pipettes. Trevor wanted the Pipettes to come in here, but... alas, they're not going to because they're frightened of Trevor, I think was the reason they gave.
So.
They said they wouldn't feel comfortable being here with someone with such obvious sexual attraction to them and someone with the history that Trevor's got. One need only glance at MySpace. What did you think of this week's Sonic Enigma?
I think it's easy.
Oh, really?
I think it's really easy.
Too easy. We've got it straight away.
Don't say it.
We're not
going to
say it.
Don't worry. He's panicking. Adam, not everyone is as bungling on air as you. These people, the competition here, have got a cool, calm collectedness that we associate with people that have got no obligation to the show. Matt, what should we do? Now we've got Trevor out there dressed in all that gear. Trevor has actually gone out of the studio now. What should we do?
Let's mess with him. God, is he hidden his clothes?
I did it. I've already took his clothes and hid them. As soon as you mentioned it, I took them out and I've hidden them.
Yeah.
But we have to reveal that so that on air he has the realisation of that. Because we don't want him not realising until after the show's finished that he's got no clothes.
I've got a better idea.
What?
We phone DHL.
I've met that woman. Yeah, go on.
And we get his clothes sent somewhere on air, like well, now.
Let's call DHL.
And we get them sent to some location so he has to go there
and get them in his tutu. Brilliant idea. Adam, Steph, will you get to DHL on the phone and put them through to the desk, please, during the next track? And we'll make Trev listen to it on the phone.
Or we just get a cab, send them in a cab, go, can you take this man's
clothes? No, it's funny if it's DHL.
Yeah, we're advertising them now.
Other delivery services are available. There's that brown one. They're called something else. What are they? UHL.
UPS.
UPS!
Brilliant.
Well done.
We'll get one of them too.
Undue prominence there. Okay. All right, so let's listen to... What are we going to listen to now?
Shall we listen to Trevor's Sonic Enigma again?
Let's have another listen to Sonic Enigma while Trevor's not here. Then we can express our true feelings without protecting him.
Okay.
Oh, I made cotton chips, please.
Right, okay.
Well,
will
you like Eccles Devil or a play of my shippies?
No, I just have cotton chips, please.
But sausage roll, all pasties.
It's the way he says onion rings in a
minute.
What's this bit? It's just indulgent.
It's really indulgent.
Just such a self-indulgent.
Why do you think he's doing this Elvis thing all the time? Do you think?
He's obsessed.
No, but I think he's angling for some sort of... Trevor really sounds like Elvis.
Oh, Trevor's like Elvis. Perhaps we should make a film about Elvis and have Trevor play Elvis. That's what he's clearly angling for, isn't he? He's clearly got something like that going on. All right, so if you know the answer to that, 64046, or you can email us. Remember what we said about that Guillemots thing? Wait till you hear the track and then text us and email us because we can't answer the phone in here. So we're going to ring Trev. But first of all, let's have a little listen to Soul Wax, shall we?
Yeah.
And then we'll sort out this. We'll send off Trevor's clothes somewhere.
And if you're in the West End of London, you see it. Sad pug-faced little ballerina.
kick him to the floor. Stamp the life out of that fool. He's wondering the BBC building. We're on Great Portland Street, so Trevor will be around there somewhere because he's not got much imagination. He's got my phone,
which is upsetting.
That's all right. We can get you another phone. But how do we replace Trevor Locke with? I don't know. We could train a chimpanzee to wear a tutu, I suppose. Let's listen to Soul Wax. Too many DJs. It's just me and Matt at the moment because Trev's outside. We're just ringing Trevor now. Trev's outside, dressed as a ballerina. You'll be able to see. My God, that cookie woman's attractive, isn't she? There's a woman here selling cookies to all of us, but I understand she's married, isn't she?
I don't know.
Trevor's outside, dressed in a tutu and stuff. What we've decided... Is Trevor up?
Trevor's here, but it's Peter talking.
Hello, Peter.
How are you?
I'm really well. Peter, can you what's Trevor doing at the moment?
Oh, he's doing a really athletic movement here. He's up on his toes, his backside...
Do you think this is... Hold on, Peter. Peter, describe to us what happened between you and Trevor.
Well, we were just walking down the street and we saw this magnificent sight.
Who's we, Peter?
My wife and I.
What's your wife's name?
Lorraine.
And you and Lorraine are on holiday, are you?
That's right. We came all the way from Australia just to see Trevor dancing on the road.
Is that Trevor doing a voice?
I think it's Trevor doing a voice.
Beg your pardon?
Because you sound a little bit like Trevor doing an Australian accent, Peter.
Jeez, I hope not.
Yeah, I know.
I don't look like him anyway.
Then pass the phone to Trevor just quickly for us, Peter.
Oh, just a minute here, Trevor. He must talk to you. Hi. He doesn't believe it.
This is very cold.
Right, okay, fair enough. Right, pass the phone back. Are you cold, Trevor?
Yeah, I'm cold and I'm humiliated and embarrassed. Lisa Morris has just turned up.
All right, Lisa.
She nearly crashed the car when she saw me.
Send her upstairs, for she normally crashes that car anyway. It's the way she carries on the road. She's a menace. Tell you what, all right, pass the phone back to Peter now, Trevor, because we didn't believe it was you.
Yeah, people didn't believe it was you. I know.
Hello, Peter. Sorry about that. You may have noticed that my tone was slightly acerbic. That's because I thought you were Trevor Locke. Now that I know you're not. Greetings, sir. Welcome to the Russell Brown Radio Show. Thank you for your help.
Thanks, Russell.
So,
how are you at all?
What we need you to do, Peter, is just to describe. Let me let you in on a secret, Peter. We've sent Trevor out of the studio dressed in a tutu. What we're going to do now is we're sending his clothes via a delivery service to Chariot, which is in London. It's a gay massage parlour and sauna and meeting place for gay people around Liverpool Street. I understand it's quite a nice establishment. We're going to be sending his clothes there. Don't tell Trevor that, because it's a little surprise for him that we're going to reveal to him in a minute. But first of all, Peter, could you instruct Trevor to begin his dancing now?
Well, he's been cavorting all over the place.
He's doing dancing now. He's doing it anyway.
He has been. He's getting rather tired. He's stopped that and he's starting to do... He's acting as a traffic policeman. He's holding up the traffic
here
now.
He's holding up traffic?
Yeah, but they're taking no notice whatsoever. He obviously doesn't look like a policeman, I don't think.
He doesn't have any authority, does he, in that tutu?
Well, he doesn't actually look like a bobby either.
He doesn't act like one, does he? Let's be honest.
Well, he's very friendly. I mean, now he's kissing the passers-by.
He's kissing passers-by.
Oh, God.
Peter, give the phone... Peter, thank you very much for your help and for authenticating Trevor.
Peter.
Would you pass the phone back to Trevor now?
Hello.
Trevor, you all right, mate?
Yeah, do you want to speak to Lisa?
No, send Lisa up to the studio.
Go up to the studio immediately. Wanted
there. I'm coming. Oh, look.
Just send her up. Trevor?
Yeah?
You know your clothes?
Oh, no. Oh, no.
We're sending your clothes to Chariot's gay massage parlour around Liverpool Street. Because we know how much you like those kind of environments. You'll be able to pick them up later.
That's not nice. That's all I've been through. I've been so nice to you this weekend.
You've not been that nice, Trev.
Trev, all you got to do is drive there in your tutu and go ask at reception for them.
And take an MP3, record it. And we can listen to that on next week's show. It'll be entertaining, won't it,
mate? I want to go to bed.
Sorry, Trev. Perhaps you can go to bed in Chariots. I'm sure the lads there will be grateful.
Bye-bye. Thanks very much.
He's trying to get back quickly. Let's call DHL or another
service.
You
shouldn't have blown that so soon to him.
No, okay, it's all right. It's fine.
We'll tell him that they've already gone and we need to get those.
That's all right. We'll do it. No,
I'm coming back now.
Trev,
he heard that.
Get him off the line. Bye, Trev. Love you, love you. Right, okay, then. Let's cut Trevor off. So is this the number for the... Right, call the chariots first. Let's call them now. Let's go through some other people's love things. Right. Hello, Russell and friends. This is from James Smart, Wiltshire. During the summer of 2001, I was out of my head with first love. At the time, it felt like a Philip K. Dick-style brain attack, though in hindsight, I can laugh about it. But at the time, it was terrible. It was all very high concept, and the various ways I tried to cope with it included putting my head in an industrial freezer for 10 minutes at a time. Interesting way of coping. This fella... James Smart Wiltshire tried to cope with love by putting his head in an industrial freezer. And reading Victorian novels while wearing a Phantom of the Opera mask. Also reverse Buddhism, brainwashing, and interesting way of coping with love with James.
That didn't sound like it was a positive experience for him.
What, falling in love?
Putting his head in a freezer?
Doesn't sound like it.
Silly.
Sounds like he had a terrible time of it.
Should we play a tune while we sort this out on the phone?
Okay, let's do it. What are we going to listen to?
Pearl Jam.
No! It's Wouldn't You Miss Me, Sid Barrett. Oh no, it's a live Pearl Jam. Why have you moved to Wouldn't You Miss Me?
Because it's a bit down and I thought...
When did that decision get made? I like Wouldn't You Miss Me. Put it on now.
We're playing it in the
Pearl Jam. Put it on.
Oh God, hang on a minute.
All right, listen to Pearl Jam then. No, listen to Pearl Jam. Let's put Pearl Jam on, let's have a listen to that. This is Russ Brown 6 Music, here's Pearl Jam.
This is Sid Barrett now.
Oh is it? You've changed to Sid Barrett, Wouldn't You Miss Me? But we dedicate this to Trevor Locke.
Right, so Sid Barrett,
Sid Barrett, great, let's listen to it.
Six music.
Trevor's back, you alright, Trev?
No, I'm in a severe state of trauma, I don't know what's gone on.
We're just having a bit of a laugh.
It's not a laugh at my expense, this is getting out of hand.
Did you enjoy that? What, do you think it's like army bullying or something?
Well, I don't know if this happens in the army.
Did you enjoy, well, apparently it does. Apparently this is exactly the sort of thing
What happened, two little twins, dressed in pink.
Yeah.
Came up to me. Wasn't that weird? I'm dressed in pink, in a pink tutu.
How old are these twins?
Sort of angelic
I don't know, 9-year-old blonde twins. It was sort of
eerie, like
eerie,
Kubrick-esque.
Yeah, it's like
Kubrick-esque. Yeah, there'll be corridors of blood later. Yeah. I'm convinced. You look ever so nice.
Thank you.
Right. Well, anyway, Trev, we've sent off your clothes.
I've put Matt Morgan's phone down my knickers.
He's got in my phone.
Down your knickers.
Yeah.
Did you down that skin?
Yeah, and I'm hoping he gets some messages because I think it might be quite exciting.
Trevor, is that on your skin or in your neck against your material pants?
It's on one side, it's against my material pants, and on the other side, it's against my flesh knickers.
Oh, Trevor, look at Matt's skin. Yeah, Matt's getting all aggressive.
He's putting his hand down.
Did you just touch his genitals?
Yeah. No, he didn't.
For you. What's wrong with you? I'm
wearing skin tight knickers, mate.
Down Trevor's pants.
Well, I want that out of there, please.
Come on, chaps. Let's concentrate on what we're supposed to be doing.
Massage part. This is silly.
Oh my God. Go there and get them.
Well, okay,
if you leave now,
you
could be by the end of the show. Yeah?
All right. I see what this is saying. You want me out of the show, don't you? Fair enough.
Well, actually, Trev, you don't contribute much.
Yeah, I understand.
What's this about you directing traffic?
Were you directing traffic out there, dressed in that tutu?
Yeah, I thought it would be quite funny.
Sounds absurd.
I remembered this is not a TV show, but a radio show, and no one's watching.
Okay, let's have it. Right, so your Sonic Enigma, guess what? No one's entered it, Trev. people are abandoning it as an idea. People don't want to be involved anymore.
Really?
People were sustaining interest for as long as you were in the studio. The minute you went out, people thought, this is our opportunity. They sent us text messages saying, what's wrong with Trevor's Sonic Enigma? Thank God he's out of the studio, dressed.
It was a house of cards.
As Darcy Bustle. He just fell down.
I thought I looked a bit more like Nurith.
Apparently it's too easy as well.
Yeah, should we listen to it alive by Pearl Jam? Then we can wrap up this competition. Then we've got Matt's cultural review. Lisa Morris is here, probably traumatised by the sight of him nimble-footing about in the road. Terrorising twins from the sound of things.
Cake Lady's here as well.
Cake Lady's here? Yeah, let's get Cake Lady in. Why not? It's nice to... There's a woman here selling cakes to us. Why do you bring her here? Is it because you fancy her? Because she's beautiful?
No.
She's married? She told me that you've been harassing her, Trevor.
I haven't been.
You said you've been suggesting unusual and disturbing ingredients.
You can say anything now, erotic, and we know it's nonsense.
Erotic cookies. You've been asking her, mate.
Yeah, sparkle buns, dinkle sprinkles all over them. You suggested.
I never would use that sort of language.
Let's listen to Pearl Jam, shall we? Hello there.
Hello.
This is Russell. You know me, Russell, don't you? My code word is, in fact, Russell.
Sorry.
You know Russell. You normally pick me up in NW3.
Russell. Okay.
Yeah, my code word, my code is Russell.
Alright, okay.
That's my PIN number, which I'm going to have to change now, obviously. hello, I need you, you normally pick me up from in NW3, I won't say my address because I do a radio show. Do you know me? Do you know who I am? I'm not saying that, but do you remember me from, because I'm a regular user of your cab firm?
I'm not too sure, mate, I'm new here myself.
Ah, you're new here, well, welcome to the taxi firm. I've just got a job for you. I need you to pick something up from Gildea Street, Portland Place. Have you got that? Gildea Street off Great Portland Street, actually.
Street,
it's the Six Music Building.
Gildea.
Yeah, that's Gildea. And I need you to pick up, how quickly you can get here? We need you here in sort of 5 minutes to pick up some clothes.
What, 5 minutes?
It'll
be at least 15, 20.
15's cool, 15's cool. Yeah, just come as quickly as you can. And we need you to pick up some clothes and I need you to take them to Chariot's Massage Parlour.
Yeah.
And that's in Shoreditch, that's just off Shoreditch High Street. And we need to, the driver's got to take some clothes in there. It's,
What number Gildea Street are you at?
It's called Westland House, it's the main street. What number is it?
99.
Now, you've got to pick up, the clothes of Trevor Locke and take them to, Chariot's Gay Massage Parlour in Shoreditch.
No problem, mate. What's your phone number there?
What phone number can we give? Might as well give Trevor's phone number.
We'll phone you back in a minute. We'll call you back and give you the number.
Tell me the number for Six Music. 0207-428. It's 0207-428-2644.
Or text us on 64046.
So, 15 minutes, yeah?
Yeah.
Cheers. All right, mate. Thank you very much. See you in a minute.
Yeah, bye.
Bye. Trevor, your clothes is going on a special journey, aren't
they? Yeah, well, I hope you're proud.
I am proud.
Yeah, Can I have my phone back? He's got my phone in his pants.
He's not going to give you his phone back after you've just augmented and orchestrated his clothes being sent off to a gay massage parlour.
I know.
Trevor, this for you could be a dating opportunity. Lisa Morris is here, everyone. Let's create some atmosphere. Woohoo! Woohoo! Right, hello, Lisa. Thanks for coming.
You're welcome, Russell. Thanks for having me.
Did you see... You saw Trevor in the street, did you?
I did. It was a complete surprise.
How was he carrying on?
He was...
what was he doing?
Really, you know,
what was he doing?
A bit shady.
Use a verb.
Kind of talking to young girls, basically.
He was talking to young...
Lisa.
Trevor, that was not
but
part of the task.
I wasn't.
Why are we talking
doing?
To young girls?
I wasn't.
Having photos taken with them.
Oh,
my photos
Trevor.
Taken them. I did not talk to them. I was talking to
yeah,
someone
actually,
else.
Yeah, actually, you didn't talk. You were quite rude to them. You saw
I was on the phone to that little fella there.
You just went, oh, thanks, and sort of like...
Blasé. Nonchalant
and off they went crying.
I thought
really?
You were a
making
person.
Children cry.
Yeah.
Did you not do any dancing?
He didn't do any dancing, no. I'm gonna hire him for my daughter's birthday party. He looks
I'd
great.
Keep him away from your daughter's birthday yeah. party if I was you, Lisa. I think the last thing any children's party needs is Trevor Locke going around making children cry. He's got yeah. 2 17-year-old Italian girls living in absolute dread.
They are
in his house.
Years old.
Are they both 18?
We yeah, spoke
she turned
to those
18
girls.
On Wednesday.
Thank God. Thank God that she's edging towards adulthood and keeping you potentially out of jail. We've also got Xanthi here, who's known as Cookie Girl. Create atmosphere for Cookie Girl, yes!
Hello.
Hello, Xanthi.
Hi, Russell.
So, why Trevor organised you coming, did he?
He did, yeah.
On what grounds?
To bring cookies for you all.
Why? Well, how did he justify it?
He didn't really justify
well,
it.
Let's just explain to people that are deprived of visual medium. Xanthi is sexually attractive. She's a sexually attractive woman.
Look, I have a mid-morning sugar dip around about 11:30.
The mid-morning sugar dip is how Trevor describes coating his genitals in sherbet. That's what he calls his mid-morning sugar dip. You're a sick and twisted individual. Xanthi, you've been brought here. It's lovely to have you here.
I have straddled.
Trevor
before you.
Well, be careful.
Quite nightly for about a month.
What?
That's
empty. What exactly is happening
we,
here?
We did a play together. We worked together.
Oh,
in
really?
Edinburgh, yeah.
You know, one of those.
You did write
it was, he wrote it. Or... Yeah, he did write the play and cast the play.
I've been in one of
and direct
plays.
It.
Yeah, I know. That's why it's essentially live pornography. if it had appeared on the streets of Patpong, Bangkok, I think the local residence committee would have got together to have it banned. Trevor's plays are essentially one man's decadent fantasies marching across the stage, make the work of the Marquis de Sade look jaded, tired and inhibited. Xanthi, thank you for coming. So can I have
would
a cookie
like
then?
A cookie, yeah.
I'd love a cookie.
Okay, there's milk Belgian chocolate.
I love that
yep,
one.
Go for that one. Anyone
thank
else?
One, please.
Yeah.
Really nice. Okay, so let's wrap up. We need to get some entries for Trevor's Sonic Enigma brought into this studio, please. Let's
good cookie.
Oh, have a listen to this song and see what it inspires in you. This might be interesting. Now, we're doing Trevor's Sonic Enigma. How are you feeling, Trev? Why do you look so listless and miserable and unhappy? I've never seen anyone look so miserable in a tutu before, except perhaps the vicar in Morris's song.
I just think that, you know, you're going a little bit too far.
What with? What have we gone too far with?
Well, you're just picking on me in a ridiculous way now. Now I've got to go to Shoreditch. I don't have a day off. I never have a day off. Yesterday was my day off. I had to ferry those Italian girls to FedEx.
You didn't have to do that, Trev.
Do the thing with
what
my
was,
bottom.
Why were you ferrying them to FedEx? Because you murdered them. Was it their corpses that you were taking to FedEx?
Because it was a thing I had to pick up. And then...
What's this thing? What's going on with these Italian girls? You shouldn't
thing?
Be allowed to have Italian girls
they
living in these house.
Food parcels
look
sent
at you,
in
you
by
sat
their parents.
You're a transvestite. You've got teenage girls living in your house. You're going now to a gay massage parlour. And you've got children living in your house. Let's get their parents on the phone in Italy. Who speaks Italian? This is an outrage. Matt, I'm worried. Are you worried about the way he's living?
I'm deeply concerned.
Cookie Girl's just been sicking around cookies. Lisa Morris looks destitute. I've never seen it like this. Okay, so we're trying to wrap up Trevor's Sonic Enigma. Let's tell you something. Every single person that entered the competition got it right.
However, every single person in this room didn't get it right.
Except last week's competition winners, Chris and Steve, they got it right.
Which is ironic because last week they didn't actually get the competition right, they had to Google the answer.
You cheat!
They just confessed
you
to Google
dirty cheats! Yeah. Oh, you are the Sonic Enigma equivalent of OJ Simpson. I just hope you don't get away with it. Not that he was guilty.
They went to www.cheatsonicenigma.com and found out the answer.
Trevor, again, talking of the Enigma as if it's a cultural phenomenon. As if it exists independently of him, as if it's a Siamese twin.
It does it
sucking
exist
out
independently
his
of me.
Trevor, you don't even exist independently. We've got Jessica on the line. She is a person that we believe has got the right answer. There seems little point in playing the Enigma again, as every one of our listeners already knows the answer. Jessica, hello.
Hello, Russell. I'm really sorry to correct you, but I'm Jacqueline.
Jacqueline, I'm very sorry for getting your name wrong. How are you, dear?
I'm very well, thank you.
Have you been enjoying our radio programme that we make today?
I love your radio programme. I listen to it on Sunday mornings every week.
It's good to do that. Just listen to the podcast as well, because we're trying to get to the top of the charts, as a matter of fact.
I haven't done that. I will try that.
There's extra bits on the podcast. Sometimes Trevor is a lot more honest about his relationship with those Italian girls. For example, the Italian police are now in possession of podcast number 7 and 8 and are scrutinising it.
Well, I shall have to listen to that.
Yeah, you ought to. It's interesting stuff. So you think you know the answer to the enigma?
I think I do.
Have you ever got an enigma right before?
Yes, I have. I got the Beatles one about the bathroom window.
Oh, yes, of course. Trevor, would you like to say hello to Jacqueline?
No.
Why? What's wrong with you?
Because it's a convention, it's a cliche. Why should I say hello to people just because you say, would you like to say hello to someone? I mean, that makes me feel like a child.
I'll tell you what it is, Trev. It's being polite to people. It's not had the common courtesy
it's not polite,
to
it's
enter
not
your ridiculous contest.
Meet? Yes, we are next
you
week.
You are. Are you going to come right? If Jacqueline gets it right, and we know that she has got it right, because everyone who enters the competition has got
it right.
When
it means
something. Be in London, though.
Say hello to her in the flesh. It sounds like you're going to shout into her bottom, which wouldn't surprise me, looking at the way you're dressed, you disgusting animal.
Well, maybe I will shout into her bottom, and maybe it'll echo back. Me.
I think what it would probably echo back is that you are a pervert. Stop
maybe
leaning
the
on your microphone.
Primitive man on the wall.
Stop leaning on your microphone like that. You're not a Ramon. Let go of it.
I will not let go of my microphone. The way I choose to use my microphone technique is up to me. Don't you bully me any further.
Oh, are you standing up to me, Trevor?
I am literally
standing up in a tutu. What a ridiculous sight. Oh, he's flashing.
That masculinity.
Matthew's phone is half ingested into Trevor. It looks like it's scurrying to freedom. Matthew, we'll get you another phone on expenses.
They shouldn't have to worry with that. Masculinity is going to work really well when you get to the old massage.
Yeah, yeah, it is. Yeah, Trev, they're going to love that gear down there.
Give me my clothes. I want my clothes. I'm a man. I'm a real man in a tutu with easy access to all of my orifices, and I want to be treated with respect.
Trev, can I have my phone? I've got to go.
Trevor, stop touching the microphone. Trevor, stop touching the microphone. It's making a terrible din on air. Let go of it. It's a technical
if
problem.
If I let go of it now, it's going to crash.
I'll tell you what will crash is your career if you don't start listening to the people that are instructing you.
If there are any of Matt Morgan's friends listening, please ring his phone now.
You dirty animal.
Because I'm hoping he switched it to vibrate.
Oh, Trevor,
sit on it like that.
You've been
where is it in your knickers?
You're never getting that back, Matt. Not after you had that colonic yesterday. He's all open, gaping, and ready to take calls. That's Trevor Locke. I'm sorry, but, you know, that's the truth. Jacqueline, what's the answer to the Sonic Enigma, my dear?
Okay, the answer is there's this guy works down the chip shop to Where's His Elvis by Kirsty MacArthur.
Is that the right answer, Trevor?
Well, of course it is, otherwise she wouldn't be on air, would she?
Well done, let's create atmosphere, correct answer, yes! Yeah, all right, we're all alive at the same time. Humanity, hooray for humanity. But, you know, we could have given it to Nick Godkin, we could have given it to Alan in Plymouth, we could have given it to someone in Liverpool, we could have given it to Dale Priestley. Jacqueline, we did give it to you. There's a countless correct answer. Not one wrong answer, Trevor.
Well, there we are.
So you're
people
Sonic
are beginning
Enigma.
To get on my wavelength, aren't they?
I think what you're...
beginning to win over the country.
Your Sonic platitude.
Oh, it's vibrating.
Is it really?
Oh, yeah.
Someone's ringing it. Oh,
it was a disgusting
animal.
It was a text.
Let's just hope no one rings it. Trevor, if anyone...
read that.
If someone rings that phone, you're paying for the dry cleaning of the tutu. Let me tell you, okay?
Oh, this is disgusting.
It's immoral. It's amoral.
I
it's disgusting.
I liked him when we were bullying him and my phone wasn't involved.
Yeah, no, it's terrible.
I shouldn't have given it to him.
You should never have given him your phone.
Where
never
is
trust
it?
Trevor
Locke. Is it front or back?
It's in him.
Front, isn't it? Oh, another one. That's nice.
Oh, Christ. Okay, listen. Let's listen. We're going to listen to the Pipettes. Probably the Pipettes.
Yeah.
Oh, Jacqueline, thanks, darling. Well done. Congratulations.
Thanks.
Brilliant contribution.
Well
are you coming
well
in next
done,
week, Jacqueline?
Yeah, I'm really looking forward to it.
Bring some people in. And when I say people, I mean protection, because Trevor Locke is usually overly amorous with competition. He considers them his prey. He's got the same attitude to competition winners that Fred West had to his daughters. Thank you very much, Jacqueline. Okay,
thank
so
you.
I'll tell you what. Let's listen to the Pipettes, other people that Trevor has terrified and stalked. Then we're going to have a bit more of a chat to Lisa Morris. Who knows what the cookie girl's going to do? Let's ring up Noel. We had a little chat to Noel earlier. We're ringing back. We've got Matt Morgan's cultural review. Yes. You went to an opera, didn't you, Matt?
Yeah, and I don't speak like that.
I went to the opera. This is what I've done. I'm some effing opera. I stuck something out of my bum.
Let's have a listen to the Pipettes. But first, a little trail, I believe.
Six music.
That there was the Pipettes, Paul Shapes. The Pipettes who won't be coming into the Russell Brand Show on Six Music with Trevor Locke and Matt Morgan. Why, Trevor?
Because they've got something better to do with their tour.
They value their sexual dignity. That's why, Trevor, and they don't want to come in here and be lunged at by a man in a tutu who's even now plotting his route to a gay massage parlour.
How many texts
not attacking
have I had?
Homosexual lifestyles, we're attacking Trevor Locke.
How many texts have I had?
You've had two texts and...
Give Matt his phone back, you pervert.
Luckily they came through in Braille.
You sick animal. What's wrong with you? What's wrong with this man?
Nothing is wrong with me. It's the way you treat me.
Lisa, come up to the mic. Step up to the mic, baby. We're talking about love. What was your first love, Lisa?
My first love?
Yeah.
As in a person or
thing?
Didn't
you used to get picked up from school by a bros?
No, not quite.
Well,
no.
Tell us about
that. I met them at a junior best disco at the Hippodrome when I was about 15.
What were you doing at a disco when you were 15?
Well, I used to go to all sorts of places when I was 15.
Did you?
I used to dress up like Sade, put red lipstick on, high heels and grease my hair back and
go out to... Off you go.
Pubs, yeah, clubs, you know. But it was a junior best disco. It was for teenagers.
What were bros doing there?
They were performing.
Oh, right, fair enough.
Mm. Well, they never picked me up from school.
Why not?
Set the scene.
Set the scene.
Okay, so we went there, we got there a bit, and the woman was had to talk us through this Vel, she was called, attractive.
For an hour.
Talking us
Russell
through it, I was so bored.
It was so rude. You got the newspaper out, you started texting.
Me and Matt were mucking about first, being all silly, going, we'll stick it up each other's. Oh, would you mind putting it up? Well, what are you going to be wearing while we do this? Here, put this on. What kind of bra are you wearing? Do you love me? Have you got a boyfriend? And she went, look, you're going to have to be a bit more serious about sticking this pipe up your bum. And I sort of thought, well, if we're going to have to be serious, I'm just going to sit and read. So I sat and read.
You sat and sulked, let's be honest.
You can call it sulking.
What did she say to you? And she goes, oh, he was getting impatient. And she'd been doing this hour talk, Chris.
Boring.
And she goes, patience is a virtue. And he went, so's brevity.
So's brevity, dear. Just get things done. Because it wasn't about telling us about colonic irrigation. It just was, I'm going to enjoy being in a position where I can arp on.
No, because me and Trevor got really interested.
We got really into it. We learnt stuff about our bodies.
Yeah, well, I've learnt something about your body, Trevor. It contains fluids that mankind should never have to witness. It was mad. So Trevor went in one room, Matt went in the other, and I was kind of like hovering between them in what can only be described as a Michael Carrick role, linking them both of them up. So it was wonderful actually, because there was like whale music playing in both the rooms, right? And Trevor was laying all beautiful and composed in his gown. It's a wonderful contraption that you sit upon. You have to sort of lay on your back with your legs sort of squatted and back, as if you're trying to roll over backwards, and into a sort of a little basin. A tube is fed into your Botticello, and you don't, the effluvia and emergent substances don't go down the tube, but in fact just come out in the traditional fashion, fall into like a chamber pot, sort of a commode, and then go into a transparent pipe, and you see them whizzing by. It's like Scalectric, but with crap.
Yeah, and it's not the crap,
like
electrics.
A log flume, or like one of those water slides.
It is like a log flume. You see them go by you. I was really fascinated by that, because that is pure eschatology, isn't it? That pipe could have not been seen through, and you wouldn't see it go whizzing by.
I think that's half the fun, isn't it, to see what
at least
there.
Half. I loved it going by. Yeah. Right, and then sort of like, so Trevor was there, all beautifully composed and delicate, and sort of with the maternal glow of a new mother. Went into Matt. Matt was like a grunting, squalid little Viking, like a Middle Earth dwarf, snuffling. And every time I walked in there, he sat there with his legs up. It was like someone had just had a spiteful vindaloo. Oh, crikey, there I go again. Matt was trying to fight it. Trevor saw it as this beautiful spiritual experience. Matt regarded it as a sort of aquatic rape, as if he was at a war with Nemo, King
pain.
Of the Sea.
I was in pain.
You weren't you?
I had to have a hot thing on my stomach. I just had like. Crush it. It was like having diarrhea. It was awful.
I think that's because you were fighting against it, Matt. Trev went with it.
I'm not passive. Like, if Trevor's ever in prison, then good luck to him.
Trev's going to be very popular if he has to do Bird. They're going to love him in the showers. He'll make a fortune. Whereas you, Matt, you better have a lot of fags to swap, because you ain't giving out at the other end, no. Sunshine.
Russell was very sweet, actually, when he kept coming in. I don't know if he was sweet to you, because you sound like you're having good fun.
With Trevor, the whale song just seemed beautiful and like a natural part of the environment. With Matthew, you felt that he should have been listening to Enter Sandman or something. Sat there all angry.
Because I was fighting it. It hurt. It was like it filled you up with water and then it blasts out. So I wasn't letting it fill up too much. So it was a constant battle against this machine for 45 minutes.
Raging against the machine, even though that machine was in your own bum.
I know. And I think I put the pipe up far too far.
Did you? How far? Because you only meant to put the pipe up an inch, my understanding.
I sort of fed it in. I wasn't sure how much had gone in.
Because you had to feed it up yourself. It was a lot of humiliation, wasn't it? You used to have to put on those 90s, then backwards 90s. Trevor's brought it in as a prize for someone. Yeah, that you put on like a schmock that's open at the back so you can see your little bum.
How revolting that he's brought that in.
I know,
it's
Trevor,
not a
also.
Schmock. It's a smock.
The cord round your.
I don't know what a schmock is.
A schmock!
That's a Yiddish term for somebody who throws water in.
Is it?
Yeah.
The worst thing about it is it fills you up and you think, oh no, it's the same feeling as, oh my god, I've got diarrhea and I've got to go now. And the woman comes in and goes, hello, are you comfortable? Is everything right? And you're thinking is, get out,
it's
going to happen again.
I'm not pooing in front of you.
Yeah,
I find you attractive. It's difficult to poo in front of someone you find attractive.
I poo problems pooing in front of, you know,
normal people in everyday life. Matt, someone comes around my house asking for a poo in the middle of, just, could I come in for a poo? I couldn't do one at work. Couldn't, don't you? You
haven't. Well, it's happened, but not recently. I've got.
Yeah, it's happened quite frequently, quite a lot. And if there's a girl around my house, Matt goes, I can't go with her here.
Yeah, so imagine.
Can you
that.
Make her wait in the garden?
No, that's never happened. But imagine that, and then the lady comes in, she's leaning over you, touching things, you're thinking, oh,
I know,
no,
all
oh, God, there he goes again. So you go, thank you, yep, right, great. Right,
jolly good, okay, move along, quickly, quickly, okay. Knowing that there's a big well of matter and liquid within you.
Yeah, and then she shuts the door, she goes, and comes out.
Bursts out of you. It is nice, the relief of it bursting out of you, but yeah. I felt so exposed and vulnerable. I went after these two. Those two had finished having theirs, Trevor all tranquil and beautiful, Matt like a grunting, squat little ape man.
I wasn't, I was in pain, wasn't I?
I know, it's really funny. There was one bit where they've been doing it for about 10 minutes and I've just been in with Trevor and Matt sat there all snarling at the world, resenting the hose pipe within him. And I goes, oh, Trevor's in there. He's really relaxed. He's really enjoying it. And Matt went, is he? And got angry and tried to look relaxed with anger. Right, I'm going to enjoy this then. Just sat there all
filling up with stuff. There was a moment where I thought, well, I'm pulling it.
Were you going to put it out?
Because she said, like, you saw so much water go in there. And then you think, well, that's all in there. And then you get these pains quite high up in your stomach. And you're meant to hold this vibrating massager thing on your stomach. That was too much.
And only on your stomach, Matthew. What you did was, it was an abomination. And then I had to go after the pair of them. I went on my own. And them two sat at the end of my bed eating crisps and popcorn and watching me get colonic irrigation like it was entertainment.
Some of the stuff that came out of you.
Nice, I thought.
What about that musket ball that came out of me?
Matt had a musket ball in him. Were you in the American Civil War, Matthew?
I think
like General Custer's armpit and stuff that came out of you. Ridiculous.
I think it was a pee.
It wasn't. Well, I haven't eaten peas for a long time.
I know, but that's what they say happens. They say you can have peas.
How would a pea not decompose, though, Trish?
Well, it gets lodged in one of those little pockets in the colon. And
Lodged in the colon pocket?
Yeah,
what is
exactly.
This?
And then
what
it can cause diverticulitis.
Radio now?
Well, if you'd have paid attention instead of texting and reading your own article, which you must know how it goes in The Guardian.
Good, then, that article.
Yeah, but you shouldn't have read it.
I was
again
just trying to
again.
See what was happening in it. I can't remember. Sometimes they print it a bit different, change bits like some of my odd analogies. Right, so let's listen to, we're going to listen to a session track now from Massive Attack, Karma Coma. This would be good to listen to this. I think there's a trail before, but then Karma Coma would be interesting to listen to that. Then we're going to be back with Trevor's Sonic Enigma, Matt's Cultural Review. Noel Gallagher, don't know he's going to turn up. I've got a strange feeling about him today. Got some interesting people in the studio. Trev's brandishing his poop smock like it's a flag seized from a enemy's
smock. No, it's clean.
He's yet unknown.
Mine was soaking wet with sweat. Why was it so horrible for me and everyone else?
Because you were fighting it. You were looking at it as if it was a scene from Prick Up Your Ears, the Joe Orton autobiography. The rest of us saw it as a sort of a medical service. Let's listen to Karma Coma. Matthew, you just got to chill out, man. Good to have access to them BBC archives. What, after what they done to Dad? Burning not only but also or something. Do you remember, you know about that?
Yeah.
They done loads of crazy
this
stuff.
This Steptoe and Son episode's got
they burned Steptoe and Son. They done some
was
crazy
that BBC?
Things.
Yeah,
we're talking about First Love, aren't we? If you've got First Love email or something there, Trev?
I do. It's from John. It's quite funny. I met my First Love in the Army Cadets.
Nice.
Didn't really work out, though.
If there's one thing that the Army's for, it's for introducing young men to each other and getting them to fall in love. I like to think of it like that.
Well, it's not. Apparently, it says, it didn't really work out as I spent every afternoon shouting at her and making her do press-ups. I don't know.
Maybe I went out of this girl once. Actually,
angry.
It was that Cassie. You know that Cassie who sold that kiss and tell on me?
Yeah.
Right, she told me that she went out of a boyfriend before.
Can you say this?
Yes. Oh. She went out of, like, her boyfriend was like, he used to be in the army or something, and he used to get her and another girl to do, like, loads
you
of...
You can't say this.
Yes, I can.
Press ups.
Used to do, like, mad stuff, make them have baths together, and would shout at them and that, and, like, he was a drill. Right, you two, get off of each other. Right, you comb your hair. Kiss that one on the bum. And she,
really?
Yeah, she told me all about it.
What, and because he was high up in the army, because he was treated like that and he wanted to do that in his private...
I think it was like he was on the receiving end of it. It's like that bully syndrome, you know, bullies used to be bullied, that thing. A bully boy spiral, reaching back in time, man. We're all bullies in our way, that is our crime, man. You like Jack Kerouac, Trev, you're been to that beat-style
like
poetry.
Jack Kerouac.
Don't you?
Well, I've never read him. So
you should, Trev, because he's ever
judgment.
So good.
Yeah, is he good?
You should have read him while you were in your little Superman sickbed as a kid.
Lawrence Ferlinghetti, that was the reference I made.
Oh, I'm so sorry.
But
I'm so
sorry.
Trevor. Why don't you just pull me up when I'm trying to make a radio show? I'm so very... Why don't you read out that email thing?
Just read it out, haven't I?
You read it out already?
Yeah, we just heard it.
What was it?
We just had a conversation about it.
Oh, yeah, I remember. Nice, I enjoyed that.
Read it again if you want.
No, let's not do that.
What's your first love story then, Russ?
Well, I've got quite a few. Well, I mean,
quite a few first loves.
Yeah,
it was, had them all, it was a big orgy, was it?
I'd fall in love quite regularly.
There must have been a first one.
You shouldn't put your elbow in there, Trevor. It's audible. He's putting the elbow on his microphone. He's dirty
he's
yellow
the
elbow.
He's putting the elbow.
Cat down a whoopsie me berry.
So you've got so many first love stories, there's none to tell.
A logical point here, there can only be one first love.
Okay, well... Well, all right.
All right, you can think about it and we'll come back to you later.
I remember when I was seven going, Mum, when I'm old enough, can I marry you, please? So it's my mum, really. I wanted to marry my mum when I was younger.
That's so cute.
It's nice, isn't it?
Yeah.
Nice to want to marry a mum.
Yeah.
Certainly not disturbing and macabre.
isn't that all we want to do?
All of us?
Yeah. Wasn't that interesting?
Hold on, it's Noel. Noel, hello?
Yeah, man.
Wait. I've got you on loudspeaker on my mobile, but you're not very audible. How's it going? You okay?
Yeah.
Can we ring Why are you talking like that?
I don't know, I'm just in a funny mood today.
You're in a funny mood? Alright, I'll tell you what, can we ring you back in 5 minutes and put you through the desk?
Yeah, man.
Is he not coming in?
Are you coming in? Because you said you were going to give me a present.
Yeah, but I was in my, I've been out in the sticks all weekend, so I'm on the way to the airport from the other side of London.
Yeah, but, another male role model lets me down. Thanks a lot, Noel Gallagher. You're just like my bloody father. Thanks a lot. Sat outside with him in my little coat with me hood up, waiting for him on a Saturday for a man that never came. Then people wonder why I grow up strange. No, can we give you a ring in a minute and put you through the desk? Oh, Christ.
He's put the phone down on you. You've offended him.
Oh, he's all right. No, so what did you want to talk about?
Well, I was just going to say, it's interesting, that last thing about the fella that got off with his girl in the graveyard. I think that happens quite a lot, actually.
Well, people get off of each other in graveyards.
I think so. Yeah. I think it's a quiet place to go for that sort of first love experience.
Among the dead, Trevor. Mm. Love among the dead.
Well, it's interesting, isn't it?
How sex and death.
You know, sex and death and this sort of...
What is the corollary? What, the moment of orgasm when you forget yourself?
Well, that's one illusion you can.
You look like you had one just then, Trevor. The shudder that would just pass through your body.
Yeah, I don't like
that. I think it's just when you're that age, it's very hard to find somewhere you're allowed to go. Yeah. So it's either the park and a graveyard comes under that thing. I don't think
it's kind
teenagers
of
teenagers think. The thing about love is it's about mortality and death. I think we should go to the graveyard and lay on a gravestone and
make sure, embrace death.
But it's there, isn't it? It's interesting.
Death, my spectre lover, my phantom lover. Have we got someone on the phone?
We have got someone on the
phone. Let's talk to him.
All right, hello.
Have we? What, they're on the
phone? Yeah, lift up. Hello. Mick? That's the wrong thing. Mick? Hello,
yeah,
Mick?
Ross, how are you, mate?
I'm really well, mate. Sorry there, we couldn't hear you momentarily because, foolishly, we left Matt Morgan in charge of the desk. It was too
hard. Okay, fella, don't worry.
So, I was very interested to read your text. Would you tell us about your first love, Mick?
My first love was Darth Vader when he walked in Star Wars.
Yeah, the very first appearance. I mean, he was impressive.
Oh, he was, but it's just that deep breathing, weren't it?
Yeah.
You are my son. Never underestimate the dark side of the Force.
He was always all about that Force, wasn't he?
But the thing was, it was all about the fact that when, you know, he was walking and he had those sort of like PVC trousers on, they were just sort of rubbing together, weren't they?
Has it affected you in later life, Mick?
Mate, I'm a total pervert now.
That's the spirit.
Do you know what I wear in the morning?
I mean, I'm thinking an erection and a smile, dear. But hit me with some facts.
No, that's the first thing. The second thing is I put on a big rubber jockstrap.
Do you?
Yeah, because of Darth Vader.
Because of Darth Vader, you put on a big rubber jockstrap.
Well, in case he comes round.
but really, if he came round, it's Dave Prowse, the Green Cross co-ed. Oh, hello, my lovely. Oh, look left, look right. Hello, put that away. Where'd you get that rubber jockstrap from? Oh, my God.
I'll tell you what, though, it's definitely influenced my sex life totally.
Well, you be careful here, because remember, this is Sunday in the daytime, so, you know, we're on the BBC and, you know, Her Majesty and all that sort of gear.
Talking.
Absolutely. I'd never be rude, Russ.
That's the spirit, Mick. I mean, I suppose it's not really that important, but what's your sexual orientation?
Mate, I don't care as long as it's warm and hot.
That's the spirit. You're a bit like Trevor Locke in a way.
Is it rubber-based?
The institution of marriage means nothing to that man.
Is it rubber-based?
I do prefer men, though.
Do you? Yeah. I'm not surprised. I mean, some men are dead handsome. I quite like the look of some fellas. I'd never want to touch one once. Well, I did touch one once, but like,
I heard about your story in the toilet when you were trying to be a rent boy.
Yeah, it didn't work out that well, to tell you the truth. That was Matt's idea, I think. Was it your idea, Matt?
Have you still got a sticky eye, though?
Oh, come on, Mick, we trusted you. Hey, Darth Vader's had a powerful effect on you. Matt was more into Ben Kenobi, though, so he prefers musty little sexual encounters with sand people, who he also secretly hates.
I think he likes his lightsaber better.
Yeah, oh, dear. Oh, right, okay, we're getting into all sorts of crazy puns. Mick, thank you very much for your time.
God bless you, Ralph. I love you.
I love you, mate. You look after yourself. Take it easy. Ta-ra now. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
I liked him. He sounded a bit
like the way he said, I'm a total pervert.
Oh, I'm a total pervert. He had no problem with it. And why should he? He's not hurting anyone. Well, let's just assume he's not. easier for us legally to assume that he's not wading through life, breathing through like some sort of asthmatic inhaler with his lightsaber attacking folks. Okay, what about when we met Paul Weller? We were a bit nervous around him, weren't we? I felt a bit nervous to meet Paul Weller.
I think he was all right.
He was more scared of us than we were of him.
That's bears, Trevor. Paul Weller. True, Trevor don't know the difference between Paul Weller and bears.
He's a magnificent man, though, isn't he?
My favourite bit in Gentle Ben was a town called Manis. Trevor, let's listen to That's Entertainment, shall we?
Yeah, I love this song. It's the most British song you can get.
All the lyrics. When I was in Australia, because I followed a girl what I didn't love properly and didn't love me, and I was all alone. That's Entertainment was my only friend. Little Nufta. Let's listen to that.
No, it was. Listen to this, and it made me think, when I was homesick,
it's a brilliant song.
British thing was amazing.
It's one of the great songs.
Listen to the lyrics. It goes, watching the news and thinking
not eating your tea.
Not eating your tea.
How old is he when he wrote this? Sort of about 18 or 19. So, like, when he goes, sort of says, like, you know, never done nothing type stuff, that's not ironic. That's just simply how he would have spoken.
Yeah,
I think it's delightful, I must say. Should we listen to it?
Why did you take the mickey out of my Australian love affair?
Because Matt.
Trevor, he's called me Trevor twice.
I know, but I think it's because when I do that tone of voice, that cynical, loathing, detesting.
Yeah, you're getting a bit of the barrel today, which I'm quite glad about. Yeah. Well, not really. I've just been shot to pieces today, but yeah.
It's nice.
And you got off with me in one of the records.
What do you mean? Oh, what, when we were the photos. We had a photo done. That'd be a nice photo. We'll have that up on the website soon. I didn't get off with him.
No, but it looked like it, didn't it?
Don't say that. Nick will come around here dressed as Darth Vader and use the Force on us. We'll be choking for days. Hey, come on, let's listen to That's Entertainment.
BBC Six Music.
And we listen to Russell Brand on Six Music. That, there's a couple of versions of that, though, isn't there?
Yeah, that's not the most aggressive.
You like the more aggressive one?
Yeah, but that's good.
Is that the one you used to comfort you in Australia, the more aggressive one? Perhaps that one would be better, because as I remember, when you used to phone me from Australia, you were much more like this. Oh, that's entertainment. The fruit's better over here. That's entertainment. You were going on about everything's better over in Australia, weren't you?
The fruit's better everywhere else. We discussed this yesterday.
There's not a very good culture, and the television's rubbish.
Yeah, you said that in the news in Australia, the people go, right, this is the news. There's been a scandal politically. And we've got a statement here. Well, actually, I completely justify it. Look, mate, that's a crock. You're lying, mate.
Come on, Bill. That's rubbish, mate.
on the news. We're English. People like that. Michael Burke wouldn't do that. He'd go, well, Prime Minister, with the greatest respect, where are the facts to back that up? Even Paxman, the rude as well, would never go, oh, come on, Bill. Would he?
No, never. It was funny, though.
It was funny. Sounds funny. Right, so we've got a couple of challenges for Trev. Here's a challenge, Trev. Honour your marriage vows.
But as well as that,
Trevor, you've got to come back to that. You can't have that floating around in the ether.
He can have all sorts of things floating around. I've seen him have a colonic irrigation. I've seen the things he's got floating around.
I watched yours, Russell, when yours was. What's that thing?
Why is this thing flashing in here?
So someone's ringing flashing. Us.
I wonder who's ringing us.
Yeah.
A lot of stuff came out.
Probably Trevor's wife. Yeah, he slipped through my fingers. That's beautiful, isn't it?
At the age of seven, an opportunity slipped through his fingers.
That's all sorts were slipping through my fingers when I was seven. Tadpoles, skips, happiest days of my life, they were. So, Trevor, we've got to get we're doing a challenge for you, Trev. Here's one. Own up to yourself. Be yourself, stop being so afraid of your family. You're not Lady Diana. What's up with you? Why are you living in such dread and terror for? What's the matter with you, Trevor?
Well, you know, it's a difficult subject, isn't it?
What subject is a difficult
subject
one?
Subject of love. It's very, very...
very complex, love.
I think it's mental illness.
You think love is like love a mental illness?
Well, it is a mental illness, I think.
Have you got any support for that? Or are you just going to say something like that?
No.
It's a chemical imbalance trick.
Exactly. It's a chemical imbalance in your brain. It makes you have a distorted view of reality.
You don't want to eat food.
Exactly. After about 12 weeks, it disappears, and then you go back to normal, and you think, what on earth did I ever see?
Hold on. You think true love only has a 12-week shelf life? You don't think it can ever go on longer than that?
Sometimes it can, but usually no. By then, you've made promises that you've you have to keep.
Yes, Trevor. Mostly to your family in your case. Trevor's actually doing V signs at me there. Trevor Locke, one of the great Englishmen.
I think you're
acting like a yobbo.
You can be in love your whole life with someone.
Why are you saying that over there to him and not saying it to me?
Because I'm addressing it to him, because he said you've got 12 weeks.
You have got 12 weeks. To be in love, you've got 12 weeks, and then after that, you've made promises that you keep for the rest of your life. Yeah, the love bit, the love bit, the tingly bit, the breathless bit where you can't eat, where you get palpitations, butterflies in your stomach and all that, that only can last for a maximum of 3 months.
Yeah, but then it might come back.
Trevor tries to recreate that rush, killing and torturing. Trevor, let's talk about your challenge. Get a piercer from Camden or somewhere to have a numbered list of Trevor's body parts and some dice, and then just puncture things up and down his body. That's a lovely suggestion.
It's not.
Luke's got some suggestions. As Luke's usual. Become, it's built into the mythology of our programme. If it's not grandiose to describe our programme as having a mythology, it's not ancient Greece. This week's theme is snails, says Luke. Trevor, do one of these challenges or else. Get a snail and get Trevor to eat it live on air. Surely the radio authorities don't have control of what you do to insects or Trevor.
I like snails. I'm happy to eat a snail.
Are
if
you?
Someone brings a snail.
Had you, have you eaten them before in France or something?
Yes, I've eaten them in France. I've eaten them in
decadent.
I don't think you'd want to eat one raw.
No, not raw. No, I'd like to eat them cooked. Yeah.
Well, that's maybe not may, that may not be an option, Trev. Right, you know, listen to this. This is number two. Right, you know how you don't eat biscuits like I'd previously assumed? Well, you know how you definitely eat fruit. Stick a whole banana in your mouth, spit it out afterwards, then with the mess, chuck it at your next guest on the show unexpectedly. Could do that.
Especially if it's Noel Gallagher, that would work.
He'd beat you up.
He wouldn't beat me
up. He'd punch you.
I reckon he'd get the banana and sort of scrunch it into your face.
Than me.
Trevor, he has lived the life of fighting and violence.
Doesn't
violence
matter.
Don't
I'm
matter
nimble.
To him.
I know moves.
He is a yob. He is essentially an unreconstructed lout. Just
so.
Loose. I think that he should be made to put down that guitar, take hold of a pickaxe or a shovel, be sent to some subterranean mine and toil in underground sugar caves. Russell, I know your working schedule is really busy, more busy than a poverty-driven child, probably, so it's understandable you don't reply to your MySpace messages. However, Trevor, you have no reason, so Russell should give you a Chinese burn-year-old. Trevor, you're still cruising around on MySpace, posing as a 17-year-old lesbian.
Giving up MySpace now.
Why? No, you've not.
I have.
Trevor, I don't know, how are you luring these people back to your bed if it ain't via MySpace?
Well, it's not. I don't do it.
You do, Trevor.
It's gone all wrong, MySpace.
Right, let's have a look at MySpace page and see what Trevor's been up to on there, because I think we should keep...
I notice your page has turned sort of brown.
It has, yeah.
Probably because of filth. Okay, I'm not surprised it's turned brown with all the smut flying about.
It's a golden colour.
That's interesting, actually, because your fecal matter was similarly golden.
It was,
wasn't
it? We're
going to be talking about our colonic irrigation
like
a little bit later.
Up there I've got.
Let's talk about colonic irrigation, but first of all, it's a little show we like to call the news. What track have we got coming out of the news? Is it the Smiths? Might be the Smiths coming out of the news. Still ill. Exciting. Still ill, Trevor. What song could be more appropriate to describe a man living a lie? But first, the news.
BBC. Six Music.
Still ill, the Smiths there. You listen to Russell Brand on Six Music. I'm here with Matt Morgan and Trevor Locke. We're just having our photos done. There's a girl in here, Fizz, doing me and Trev's photograph. All of our photographs, right? We're just having a bit of a laugh. Me undoing Trev's shirt and, like,
no,
kissing
looked,
him and
it
that.
Wrong.
So, what's wrong?
Russell,
that's fine.
Would be in these photos and pinched me.
I did pinch you.
Dragging me across the room.
I just can't be in the photos. Matt wouldn't be in the photographs, pretending. He's going, no, I don't like it. It looks gay, right? Which, who cares if things look gay or not? And like, but the reason he gave was it looks gay. The actual reason is because he doesn't think his hair looks nice. Because when he goes, oh, the photographer, he goes, oh, I wish someone had told me. I look like a right gippo. So let's count up the people Matt's offended today. You've offended the travelling. You've offended the travelling community. You've offended homosexuals. Who's next? Who's next? Who are you going
don't
to attack
know
now?
My name.
I
so
wish
you've offended me.
I don't know your name. This
you've
is like the bit
me.
In the jazz singer where he rips it. You are not my son. You are not my son. Rip my shirt. That bit in the jazz singer was a bit overacted. We're talking about love. Love, love. Oh, good old love. Play one of them love jingles, Matt. See what it's like.
Well, they're not set up, so.
Oh, God. You know. We had some love jingles. Their love jingles aren't set up.
You were my first love.
Nice. That works quite
first
well.
Love never.
So, Trev, you never finished your first love story.
So we went to Romeo and Juliet and we drove there in my Austin Allegro through the night to get there. It was misty, it was February, it was Warwickshire.
It was Warwickshire. That's just where you live.
It's not where I live. I live in Northamptonshire. I had to cross over to the county border. So we get there, we watch
Why?
This.
Why? Because she was underweight.
Because that's where the plays were.
Yeah, better get you out of here, girl. Yeah.
We were, I think she was 18, I was 18, and we went to the Swan to see Shakespeare, Romeo and Juliet. We watched it, and I couldn't say
anything. Stratford?
Yeah. I've been in love with her for a few weeks, and I couldn't eat. I wasn't eating properly, and I was getting up really early. I wasn't sleeping. It was terrible.
It's almost diabetes. Do you remember when we had that chronic? The woman goes, Have you got any? He goes, well, I'm almost diabetic.
Almost. Diabetic. It's not an achievement, Trevor. You can't swagger through life going, I'm diabetic, I'm asthmatic, I lie about my marital status. These things are not achievements, Trevor.
Where? I am married. Where did these things come from? Where did, I don't, anyway, stop it. Listen.
Come on in. So this here is like, yes, goes. He went to the Swan with this girl you're in love with.
I couldn't say anything to her. I couldn't really speak to her properly. We couldn't even hold hands. It was awkward.
Isn't
and then
that
there was people falling in love in front of us on stage and then killing each other.
Where you're crippled when you actually like someone.
Yeah, absolutely.
It is, isn't it? Because you can be all really cool and funny when you don't care about someone. Yeah. When you love them, why are you not funny? Where does all the funny go when you're in love?
Oh, it's because you're so vain and you think if you move your little finger, she'll notice it and think, oh, God, why is
probably
it
would notice if you move your little finger. She's probably on tenterhooks the whole time she's with you. You smuggling across county lines in your Austin Allegro so you can perform what would otherwise be an illegal act.
There just wasn't a Shakespearean theatre in Northampton, that's all. So anyway.
I'm not surprised, Trev. It's a county full of savages. What would be the point?
It would be like doing
Wagner before hillbillies.
Very cultured at 18, wasn't he, Trev?
Trevor was, actually.
Yeah.
Well, Trevor's like that, isn't it? Because he ignored mainstream culture, Matt. While you and I were liking things like Star Wars and glue sniffing, Trevor was off, enjoying, Pirandello. And reading Bukowski.
I wasn't into Pirandello at that age. It was more Lawrence Ferlinghetti. But anyway, he's not high culture. Well, he's just a beat poet from San Francisco.
Hey, but aren't we all?
Hey, in a crazy way, aren't we all just beat poets from San Francisco? Yeah. Bidibub, bidibub, bidibub.
Johnny Come Nolan had a patch on his ass. Kids chasing. So anyway,
it ends with you and me, Matt, walking away, establishing our own radio show away from that jerk.
We get back into the car. We have to go home at school the next day, and I'm driving through this mist and it's
dark.
Keep
going on about the mist.
And I said,
atmosphere.
So I tried to talk to her, and I think of, and I all I can remember saying, for some reason, I said, "Do you believe in the devil?" And
why do you ask people things like that on a date?
I can't remember, but I think we must have been having some sort of philosophical discussion.
Now,
why
have your marriage collapsed? Do you believe in the devil?
In this story, you've mentioned the fog too many times.
Too many mentions of the fog.
The fog is important, as you will find out now. I said to her something like,
do you believe in the
devil? And the next thing I know, we've crashed. I've driven into the side of the road because of the fog. I haven't noticed a corner. And what's happened is I've buckled my wheel.
That's better not be a euphemism, Trevor. Better not be.
And
I don't want to see that written on a charge sheet somewhere, wheel buckling on the county borders.
So she was really shaken because I'd mentioned the devil and we crashed at that moment.
So yeah. To her it looked like, went, do you believe in the devil, Harris? And then slammed into a tree.
Do you ever dance with the devil in the pale moonlight? Take that, you bitch!
Yeah.
Kiss me, you fool!
It was school tomorrow!
it wasn't
Here's
very exciting.
Trevor!
It wasn't a very exciting crash. There were no wheel spins or squeaks. It was just a thud. Buckle the wheel, and then what I had to do is I had to drive home, and the wheel was buckled, and so it made the steering wheel sort of wobble and jerk. And
you should have seen that mime, people listening. You should have seen Trevor Locke miming that steering wheel, wiggling his little body, wiggling his little bum about on the chair like a dog dragging its ass across a carpet.
It was like having to do an arm wrestle, a double arm wrestle with a sort of mad drunken sailor.
Who is this sailor? What is this metaphor? You should have read more of that San Franciscan poetry, Trev, because your understanding of imagery is at best intermediate.
Anyway, eventually we get home. It takes about 3 hours to get home because I'm doing this wrestle with the sailor in the front seat trying to get the car.
Trev, that sounds like a normal night for you these days, wrestling with a sailor in the front seat, leaving your jeans in a Soho toilet. It's the way you live these days.
I get home and then she didn't call me.
I'm not surprised, Trev.
Of course she didn't.
Do you believe in the devil? Crash. For God's sake. What, Matthew? What should we do?
I don't know.
Years later, I met her. Years later, I met her, and she said she always fancied me.
Poor girl. What's her name?
Jo.
We'll dedicate a song to this poor girl. Me and my mates used to, this is from Stacey and Hackney. Me and my mates used to think Joey from Bread was well fit. Joey from Bread was a powerful man. Yeah. Although I liked Grandad best. I want me pudding.
I want me pudding.
I want me pudding.
Didn't Joey change into someone else?
Joey changed from Peter Howe into another guy inexplicably. We were all supposed to just carry on watching.
I could never do that. Even in Neighbours when Lucy changed.
Lucy you changed.
You could never change into someone else.
I could never take that.
We're shapeshifters, man.
I like Doctor Who myself.
I'm not into shapeshifting. It's crazy. My first love was when I was 10 with Madonna in 1985. All very innocent at the time, although it actually says innocent at the time, but I don't fancy her now. Why not Alan Jepsen? Hi, Russ and team.
She's got man hands.
Say that about Madonna. Absolutely. She's a lovely woman. Love was Roland Ratt. I was aged 5 and I thought I could marry him. I'm 27 now and I've never been in love yet. Wow. That's an interesting way to regard Ron. He Rick Fiend, I liked Ron and Rat. I never loved him. I never let it become sexual. He Rick Fiend,
I hated it.
What'd you hate him for, Trev?
Awful rubbish.
Oh, right. I awful rubbish.
Awful rubbish.
Father, what is this? Have you seen this rat? It's absolutely awful.
He hates it because it's an animal that's risen up.
Yeah, risen up against him. I'm going to kill that rat. That's what I'm going to do. Then I'm going to watch Lubber him. It's massively must stop, Papa. On the subject of first love, I met my first love at Last Orders in the finest of local establishments, the Crown Inn, at the sweet old age of 16. It was a much older lady named Cheryl. I then cemented the first love in the local graveyard against what I remember to be a gravestone.
Oh, dear.
Of a that told memories of a miner called Clive, Stephen Crook.
Why does he remember of what I remember to be? If you're in a graveyard, that's not a weird memory to have.
Yeah, it's not like might be a graveyard, or it could have been the courtyard of Lakeside Shopping Centre.
No, he goes,
There certainly were a lot of dead bodies about.
It's very odd.
And also,
phrasing that.
Why would you remember the inscription on the tombstone? Because I think if someone was having it off with me, and it was like the consummation of a first love, and while that we were having that sex, they were secretly reading about a dead miner.
I mean, it's bad enough when people watch the telly.
It's bad enough, isn't it?
Reading gravestones.
Well, I don't know.
You were saying you were watching Dig the other day while someone performed a sex act on you, Matt.
I think I was saying that.
Yes, you did. Were. I let you dig, and you said that some woman was performing a sex act on you, and you were just happily watching Dig. Trevor's marriage isn't real. You don't concentrate during sex. I'm the only person who can be trusted. I challenge you two to come up with one thing that will embarrass me on air. I dare you. I double dare you say anything that embarrass me. Let's go to the track. Let's listen to the Yardbirds for
don't
your
do
love.
It. Matt, you have the power not to press that button.
Press for your love,
button.
Matthew Morgan.
Now, let me think. Embarrass Russell Brand.
Could you
Let's
do
think.
It? I'm unembarrassable.
Suppositories.
For your love.
Suppositories.
For your love.
Waxy bullets. Waxy bullets.
We're going to be talking about a colonic irrigation right after For Your Love.
Hello, is that my PA? Have you got my suppositories? Helen, I need my suppositories. Hey, Russell, here's your bag of medicines. This happened. I was in a taxi. Here's your bag of medicines. He went through it like a rat. Where's my suppositories?
Listen, them suppositories are a choice. I was just trying to get everything in tip-top shape for carnival season. Put the Yardbirds on.
Was the lesion
on.
a choice as well?
What?
The little lesion.
The what lesion?
Yeah, the little internal lesion, the little scratch.
There's no... Listen, Trevor, some of us have adventurous sex, not with women who live in other continents that we're not married to. Some of us during sex don't watch DVDs, but concentrate on the sex. That can sometimes lead to... bruising, internal bruising. When you're having proper sex, these things are risks. Matt, if you're not watching the telly, Trevor, if you're not married, put the Yardbirds on.
No, because you have to start saying good now.
Yeah.
Trevor, do you know about the scratch on his winkle?
Yeah, I've seen the scratch. He got it out in a meeting. We had a meeting on Thursday where we were trying to get a new producer for our new show, and he said, "Hold on, Trev, can you have a look at this?"
Yeah. Nice!
Whips it out at the dinner table, and I confirmed that it was indeed a scratch, and he should just give it a little time off.
And now it's fine!
Yeah.
Is it?
Yeah, of course it is. I'll show you it.
Come on in.
Oh, for God's sake, you boys!
Hang on, that lady's
thank heavens.
Please, don't take photographs of my dinkle.
This is radio... Oh, good heavens.
Oh, there's another one now. But what a night we had! We're all young, we're alive, and I'll suffer those scratches for your love!
It's a gnarled and wizened
thing. What are the Yardbirds on? This thing's gone on for ages!
That looks like a puppy dog's toy. It's been chewed.
Do you know, it's funny you should say that, Trevor, because my dog's the most satisfied hound in Christendom. Right, never gives me any trouble. Put for your love on!
Then, Trevor, you ready for that?
Put the Yardbirds on!
Let's have the Yardbirds.
You make me sick. You're all fired! This is Russell Brand on Six Music. Today is called Sunday, but it ain't that different from other days. I'm here with Matt Morgan and Trevor Cocky Locky. How the hell are you boys now? I hope you're pleased with yourself. Are ya?
You dared us, we did it.
Oh, come on! You can't destroy me with your anecdotes about suppositories. Let's have a look at what sort of emails and stuff like that.
What are those suppositories for, then?
Listen, I don't want to talk about...
I'm helping you out, eh? Something's come up. You can't just... You know, what goes up must come down.
Let's talk about that colonic irrigation, Matt. Let's talk about you sat sweltering on a bench with your legs gaping like an unwelcome mother with a mutant in the pit of her gut, grunting and squelching. We went to have colonic irrigation yesterday, me, Matt and Trevor did. Them two went first,
it's
right?
It's colonic hydrotherapy.
What's the difference?
Because that lady said irrigation means you put water in.
Trevor, turn your phone off. What's wrong with you? It's happened once. Don't you learn? What are you going to do? Leave the show, marry another South American woman and live another lie? What's wrong with you? Well, what are you going to do, Matt? Leave the show, put on that Metallica thing and have someone lick the back of your legs? Okay, so yeah, we went for this colonic hydrotherapy with that woman called Vel. It was in Harley Street we went to. Actually,
nice
Adam, we're going to give you the bill for that because we thought BBC should pay for it because it is actually content. It's content for the show, isn't it, really?
Well,
there was a lot of content, let's be honest.
Ultimately, this show is made up of our whoopsie.
Russell's not trying to hide this. Pumping out the toilets at a festival.
How dare you?
Yeah.
It was glorious. It was like a Technicolor dream coat, what was coming out of the back of me. Glorious looking stuff.
Trev had some weird stuff coming.
I had people panhandling for gold through mine.
The only panhandling you do with your trousers and pants down is when you're lingering in the Soho lavvy trying to make up your income. Trying to pay for yet another divorce, you bigamist. So like, hey, listen, right, so what's really interesting about it is like we went there and like those two went first and the woman, Vel, who's very attractive, wasn't
beautiful,
she?
African lovely woman,
very attractive, very nice big bottom and quite big boots.
And she said the word for frog in Zulu.
Yeah, what was it? It was just a click.
Bit like that.
That's how you say frog in Zulu, but when's that ever going to come up?
Well,
unless Trevor goes to Africa and wants to kill one.
He knew the word and asked her to say it.
Probably because it's part of his litany of crimes against amphibians.
Anyway, let's not get involved in that.
And yes, welcome to the BBC, and this is a download from BBC Six Music. We're taking you into the realms of the podcast, so to find out more, go to bbc.co.uk/sixmusic.
Welcome to the podcast. This is the actual podcast now.
Rolling?
Yeah.
Trevor, you got me near the mic.
Sorry, we're rolling.
Headphones on. Right, thanks for downloading our podcast. Even Chris Moyles himself has recommended it now, hasn't he? What did he say, Trev?
Yeah,
don't tell a bit about him not used to liking me, but liking me now.
Okay, he didn't not used to like you, he's always liked you.
Consistently liked me. Good old Moylesy!
Even when he was born, he liked you, and you weren't even born at that point.
That is a premonition that he must have had.
Yeah.
Who else has been recommending us lately? Someone else, wasn't it?
Jonathan Ross.
I was on Joe Wiley the other day. She likes me. A lot of BBC radio talent. Matt, why have you got this expression of cynicism etched across your angry brow?
They like me. They like me. They like me. As if you're an abstract concept. You are you.
I am me. Look at my body.
Oh. Up
you should get out in the sun, mate.
You want to look pale?
Yeah, really pale.
Corpse.
Could you say, yeah, I do look like a corpse.
You want to watch that though? That would be
I've got two moles.
That's more worrying for me, that mark there.
That lesion.
Is that a lesion?
Don't examine my corpse. I'm not a cadaver. You're not medical students. This ain't Victorian days. I ain't Frankenstein.
This is going to be an intro to a podcast.
All right, welcome. Thanks for the podcast. Listen to it now.
Thanks for the podcast. You did it.
Yeah, thanks. Bye. Love you.
BBC Six Music.
That was Echo and the Bunnymen. This is Six Music. I'm Russell Brand. We're in, guess what? It's a really good atmosphere. I think it's going to be a really good show. I'm here with Matt Morgan. He's in charge of the buttons. Yo, Matt!
Hey, Russ.
Why are you so downbeat? What's wrong with you?
I've just, you know.
What, you think that I'm being like a cliche DJ?
Yo, Matt.
How am I just being upbeat, Matt. Is that a crime? Sorry, I tell you what, let's go through life all dour, hating everything and being all cynical so that your friends have to build a cultural review into their radio show so that you have some contact with life. Trevor Locke's here. He's in charge of competitions and phone calls. Cocky Locky, you all right, mate?
Good morning. Good Sunday morning.
You stayed at my house last night, didn't you?
Yes, I did.
Yeah. Trevor Locke slept on my settee. Did you like it?
It's a very comfortable settee, yeah.
It's nice. Did you sleep well?
Not that well, no. There was a few interruptions.
What seems to be the trouble, Doctor?
Well, there was some noise coming from another room. There was a cat that...
My cat, Morrissey.
Yeah. He slept on my bed.
Did he?
Well, not my bed, it's a sofa and it's yours.
It's funny, Trev, how you suddenly take control of things and claim to own things. Was that your phone going off, Trev?
Yes, it was.
What's wrong with you?
I've turned mine off.
It's really unprofessional.
Functioning.
Anything else happened with Trevor with those Italian girls, the teenage girls, aged 17, that you've got inappropriately and, in my view, illegally living in your house?
Well, they brought a young man home the other day and walked in.
Probably just trying to have a natural childhood, Trev. Don't begrudge them that.
He walked into the bathroom and saw my dinkle.
Oh, my God. Why? Why would you even leave it in there? You should keep it with you all times, Trev. I mean, I know you don't use it often.
It was my spare one. I was washing it.
I tell you what, if I were you, I'd make the switch now. Start using that one straight away, because the one you've got's a bloody nuisance. Matt Morgan, we'll be doing your culture review a bit later, won't we?
I'm sulking after you introduced it like that.
Why?
I said, why don't we build a bit of the show? You're miserable. Yeah.
Oh, don't feel attacked, Matt. I just said that really. For a bit of a laugh. So what are we talking about today? Love. We're talking about love
first
and everything.
Love.
Ah, oh, love, eh? I mean, it just dwarfs everything, doesn't it, eh? Love? Once you, when you, you know, you, sometimes you get all, I don't mean, I'm just talking from a personal perspective, you might get all, like, I don't know, vain, egotistical, obsessed by your own self, you know, and then you think, oh, love, that's bigger than all that, ain't it?
Yeah, I think it's dangerous and should be held at arm's length.
I suppose so. What do you think, in sort of an Aldous Huxley-style future world, love would be outlawed for being dangerous?
No.
Or like in Clockwork Orange. It might
really
be.
Silly.
What about in Clockwork Orange? No one loves each other there, do they? Oh, except that writer and his wife, they love each other, but look what happened to them two. Them lads turned up round, all dressed up in masks.
And terrible business.
Behaved awfully towards them. Trev, what's the story of your first love?
Well, it's very...
I'm sure it is unpleasant, particularly for the poor lady or man involved in it, or perhaps, or whichever pet it was that you set about.
No, it was a young lady. I didn't fall in love with anything else. It was, well, her name was Jo.
Yeah.
And I took her to see Romeo and Juliet.
Clichéd.
Very clichéd.
How old were you?
18, 17.
What had you been doing up until then, Trev?
Why had you had no love till then?
I reckon he was falling in love with finger puppets until that day.
Why? But I was embarrassed about falling in love. I was really embarrassed about falling. If I liked a girl, I was sort of very humiliated by it.
It's probably, Trev, because you spent your entire school years with a paper dragon on your hand called Ricky.
No, that was only about 3 months.
And, well, what about all the animal killing as well that you indulged in as a child?
About that, and that's been exaggerated for comic effect, and it's probably run its course now.
I don't think it has run its course, Trevor. A lot of people think that animal cruelty is right up there, quite high up on the agenda. It's nice you trying to dwarf it. If I had something to be that deeply ashamed of, I'd try and belittle it as well. You can't minimise stuff like that, Trevor.
Animal cruelty is overrated.
Rhymey. Right. I hope the Animal Liberation Front are listening to this radio show.
Yeah, so do I.
You announced your address last week, or your phone number on the podcast last week. Let's have your address this time. You should have seen Matt Morgan then do a cough behind his head. Like, oh, I'm on radio. I'll do a cough like an old lady coughing into her handbag on a bus. Oh, I'll keep this cough in here for later. It can come for me now my dickie's gone.
Why are you touching yourself when you get excited?
I think it might be because...
He gets excited by an idea, he gets all on a run, and he touches himself.
I eroticise entertainment, that's why. I'm an erotic kind of guy. Now? Just fancied it. I felt like the used two were bunching up against me.
You're not allowed to stand on that thing because it echoes.
Oh, God.
For the benefit of the listeners...
It's like a bat cave.
Russell doesn't have a normal microphone like most DJs. He gets an own microphone shipped in every Sunday morning. He stands like a rock star.
I might pull down my trousers and pants. Oh, now Matt's coughing down his jumper. What's wrong with you?
I'm trying not to cough on the radio. I'm professional. Unlike you, who eats fruit down the mic.
You're like...
Sounds like someone trudging around on a farm.
You're coughing away like Charlie Cotton. a radio show with Charlie
I've
Cotton.
Got hair in my throat.
Guys, it's love this morning.
All right, we're talking about love. So if you've got any stories about love, I'll give you the address in a minute. Also, later on, there's going to be Matt's cultural review. Trevor's Sonic Enigma. That'll be a laugh. Noel Gallagher reckons he's coming in here. We've got Lisa Morey, she's going to pop down. Kimberly Stewart, all sorts of people. Trevor's got some woman who's coming in here to sell us cookies, ain't you, Trev?
Yes.
Mr. G will be doing a poem. We've got loads of stuff, but first of all, we're going to be talking about love. Also, me, Matt and Trev went and had tubes fed up inside our anuses yesterday, and all of our poo pumped out. And colonic irrigation, I think, is what
colonic
it's called.
Colonic
hydrotherapy. We're going to be telling you all about that and our different reactions to it. Obviously, I took it like a gentleman. Trevor treated it like a girlfriend. Let's listen to Jackie Wilson. If you want to tell us about your first love or any kind of love, text us on 64046 or email me at russell.6music@bbc.co.uk. Also, guess who's number two in the podcast charts? iTunes podcast, diddly iTunes charts. Us, that's who. Yes, that's right. Are you proud, Matt, to be number two in the podcast chart?
Very proud, but it's made me hungry for one.
Hungry for one. We've got to get to number one, and we're going to do something bizarre and exciting when that day eventually comes, aren't we, Trev?
We are. We're going to do an absolute extraordinary thing.
We were thinking of having a banquet on a roundabout.
A banquet.
On a roundabout with homeless people.
Come up with some ideas to help
us. Come up with some ideas if you want. We can't promise we'll do them, but we're going to do something extraordinary when we get to number one in the podcast charts. Assuming that we do. We're going to just push on.
It's an assumption.
It's an assumption, but it's
a dangerous assumption.
It's a dangerous one, but isn't that what made Britain great? Dangerous assumptions, colonialism and oppression and war. Isn't that what made Britain great? Text us 64046, email russell.6music@bbc.co.uk. Your love is affecting me in a way that I can only describe as positive, you know, in an altitude sense. Jackie Wilson. It's difficult not to feel upbeat after listening to Jackie Wilson singing that. This is Russell Brand on 6 Music. I'm here with Matt Morgan and Trevor Locke. We're talking about love. What are you on about love then, Matt, that makes you feel ill or something?
Makes you feel depressed. Like thinking
love makes you feel depressed.
Well, at the moment, because I'm not in love, it's like Christmas. When it's not Christmas and you hear a carol,
seems inappropriate.
So that song, you think, oh, this was written when someone was in love. There was some love out there.
There must be genuine love in that song, wasn't there, I suppose? Whoever wrote that must have, when they wrote it, must have been, that's got genuine love in it, that's got something offensive.
You hope it's not some cynical guy with a pen behind his ears chugging on a fag going, yeah, this is a good chord progression.
Trevor, if it was that guy, I imagine his songwriting would be interrupted by you pulling down his trousers and pants and sexually invigorating him.
Well, if that's how you want to play it, yeah.
Yeah, that is how I perceive you, Trev. As a person who literally sucks up to the man.
A muse for Motown.
A muse for Motown, a sexual muse for Motown.
Yeah.
I think you could do it, Trev.
I think
you've got it in you. Right, we've got some interesting, like, we've been talking about love on our thing, the 6 Music message board. How do people look at that, Trev?
How do they look at that?
Use their eyes and their computers, but I mean, there's probably some technical information.
You know, disappointing and sordid little festival of nastiness, really.
You think that's their perspective? Yeah. You think they regard it as a festival of nastiness?
Yeah, I think
that's how I regard your sex life, Trevor. Okay. A carnival of cruelty, a Mardi Gras of malcontent that takes place.
At least it's only once every 4 years, though, eh?
But not too shabby recently.
Trevor had it off on Thursday with a girl. Now he's got embarrassed about it. Trevor had it off on Thursday with a girl. He threw his headphones on the floor.
Trevor's just thrown his headphones on the floor.
Trevor, you're not Keith Moon. Pick up those headphones at once and be like, this is the BBC. Put that in the podcast.
You're not Cliff Richard either.
No, Trev, you are allowed to have sex. It's not like your sex life is abhorrent.
Are you crying or laughing, Trev?
Are you embarrassed about your sex life, Trev? What's her name?
No, let's not do this.
No, because she's embarrassed.
Deeply
what are you embarrassed for? Is she listening? Oh, right, okay, because he's married. He's embarrassed because he's married and it's illegal to have it off when you're married. Yeah, but come on, Trevor, your marriage is absolute farce.
Why have you got yellow stuff on your elbow?
I reckon it's connected to this sex he's been having. One day he had sex, next day he turned up at work with yellow on his elbow. It's not a coincidence. All right, let's read out some of these mouths while Trevor recomposes himself.
I've
get
got
it together.
Text here.
Go on then, Matthew, read it out, mate.
Trevor, Matt and Russell.
I'm going to do a text now. That's how you come across. Yeah, you coughed.
Yeah, because I've got something in my throat.
Isn't the old days, you're not that Keith Wolverstone.
Stop touching yourself and let me read this out.
All right, go on then.
Trevor, Matt and Russell, to my eternal shame, my first love was Stu Francis of Crackerjack fame.
I liked him. Hiya, kids. Hiya, Stu. Ooh, I could crush his grape. Ooh, I could wrestle an action man. Ooh, I could jump off a Wendy house, to name but three.
Okay. As I was 8, he was on the telly. It was never really going to come to much. Mm. Listen to this bit. My first true love in real life was last year, and it's a laborious story I won't bore you with.
Brilliant. We're not interested in laborious
stories. It was only last
year,
so she was in love last year. Now it's become a laborious story.
How quickly it turns around.
Exactly, that's my point.
So one minute you're in love, the next minute it's become a laborious story. Probably like Trevor's forthcoming divorce. This is from Rumblebee. I know a guy who first realised he was gay when watching Rent-A-Ghost. Something about Mr. Claypole's tight jester outfit created a stirring. That's from Rumblebee. I liked Mr. Claypole as well.
I liked the fact he had that
little Mr. Claypole thing. Blame that for stuff? Did he go, I think little Mr. Claypole might have touched your bottom, Mrs. Pop-Off?
No, I think that's coming from your own experience.
But hey, listen, little Russell makes a lot of crazy decisions, Matt. I won't have that guy condemned.
Yes, I've seen
He's just
papers.
Making his way through life.
Yeah, no, I used to love Rent-A-Ghost. That it was weird.
You were on about quite a lot. It was pretty weird, yeah.
The neighbours who lived next door.
They were just trying to live their lives.
The Meekers.
The Meekers. Oh, we're upset the Meekers. Why did you even need to rent a ghost for?
Yeah, that was odd, wasn't it?
Didn't even make sense as a concept. Then there's that witch, Missy Sank. She was quite sexy.
Scottish. Wasn't she super grand later in life?
I don't know if she was, but I know that she had sort of quite... She sort of had the twin assets of being an old lady.
But sexy.
And having quite big boobs. Strange, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Rent a ghost.
I used to fancy old lady. I also used to fancy Ruth Madden. That's one of my first loves.
Yeah, I fancied Ruth Madden.
She goes, hello, campers.
Hello there. Oh, Mr. Fairbrothers.
Oh, God.
She was well sexy. And what about them other three women with their nice legs?
Well, yeah, I fancied them.
It was them three women in the yellow jacket. They were meant to make us feel like that. Spike, Spike, there's a competition, Spike. Dress as a banana. I fancied that
always
guy. Spike, Spike.
And that woman in
Heidi
Lowe.
Heidi Lowe talking about.
Yeah, Heidi High was good.
Yeah.
All these things.
There was a subliminal sex, but subtextual sex. I mean, it wasn't like they were going, right, here is sexual imagery to hook you in prepubescent viewers. But that's how it works, wasn't it?
Yeah, completely. But like Ruth Maddock was sexy or
Yeah, she was. But even though she had short hair, which wasn't customary, you wouldn't fancy that normally.
She had a short skirt and she was Welsh and sexy.
Oh, Mr. Fairbrothers. She was rude, wasn't she?
Yeah.
You could tell what she'd do out.
That bird in Hello, Hello, he's went, oh, Rene.
Oh, Rene, Vicky Michelle. Oh, let's get Vicky Michelle on the show, Trev.
Oh, yeah.
You like Vicky Michelle, don't you?
Yeah,
Vicky Michelle was beautiful. How can we ever justify getting her on the show?
I'll think of a way.
Yeah, I know you will, because you're always luring people in. The poor Papini sisters.
It.
The Papini sisters have moved into a shelter for battered women just to get away from Trevor Locke.
The Pipettes have rejected me.
The Pipettes, Trev, have had the good sense to stay out of this studio, which has become known in the pop music industry as Trevor Locke's lair, as his crib of hatred and deviance. We've got another message here from Misra Quiba. Misra Quiba, that's a strange bit of language. My first love was Raphael, the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtle. From the film, not the cartoon, this person specifies.
She's not mad.
I didn't know about sex then. I was about five, so it was all very innocent, though ultimately doomed, as he was A, mutant, B, fictional, and C, living in New York. I've bothered to... All right, fair enough. I can get over this fictional thing, and I'm not prepared to overlook being a mutant. I'm a forward-thinking person, but, you know, long-distance love affairs, are they ultimately doomed and frustrating? Just ask Cocky Locky there, staring listlessly at his own lap, the seat of so much guilt and hatred, that groin, that cauldron of sex and hatred that is Trevor Locke's ghouly area.
Poor old Trev.
Poor old Cocky Locky.
If you fancy that, how can you fancy one Ninja Turtle when they're all identical?
They're all the same.
Different colours and different weapons.
Trevor, Matthew, because, I tell you why, because of their personalities, Matthew. Consider personalities when falling in love. Not like you, seeing sex as a sort of a lineup, like the usual suspects. You wandering along with a riding crop, jabbing people in the abdomen, going, her. I mean, they're all the same, but that one's got a slightly nicer gutty one. I like that one's shins. Her.
And this is nothing like you with your boob obsession.
How dare you, Matt Morgan, when I am the closest thing to Jermaine Greer you're likely ever to get in a man. I couldn't be any more feminist if I had, instead of my delightful dinkle, that other thing that they have that we prize so highly. Trevor, listen to... right, in a minute we're going to listen to the Yeah Yeah Yeahs, but first a little bit of propaganda for a programme that I'm actually in. It's a Rob Brydon programme, but then the Yeah Yeah Yeahs! Turn into the Yeah Yeah Yeahs. Listen to Russell Brand and Six Music. I'm here with...
That's a good song.
It's brilliant, isn't it?
I like that song.
It's good, isn't it? Why do you like it?
Because the melody's good.
Good, cause the melody's good.
Well,
cause I'm a bit like Rain Man. Cause the melody's good. Something not my
rubbish. These
good,
days that you're into.
Oi, I like all sorts of different things, like standing up, sitting down, moving about. Cocky Locky, why are you so despondent for?
I'm not despondent, I'm really happy.
You seem all downbeat about some things.
No.
If you've been exposed.
No.
What's wrong with you?
No, I've just received a disturbing message, that's all on my desk.
Yeah, well, here's another disturbing message. Back your ideas up, Locke. We've all got jobs to do. Here's another, there's something called the message board. This is from Schnoody Wiggler. They got funny names, everyone, on the message
Schnoody
board.
Schnoody Wiggler.
Schnoody Wiggler.
I think they make them up just for the message board.
No.
Well, you know, Trevor is a made-up name at some point. My first crush was on a blonde boy in my class called Kevin. I thought he was lovely, so I wrote him a poem during one poetry lesson. Perfect time to do it, in my view. I was 7, and I'd like to share it with you. Kevin kicks footballs all day. Every day he will say, violence I hate, I'm in love with my date, no footballer will stand in my way. It actually spells Kevin if you read it down, yeah, because the first line starts with Kevin, the next word starts with every day, and it's violence. Do you believe she was 7? Because, like, it was clever of her to mimic that poetic device. We've got a poetry expert, Mr. G's, here.
You can just copy, can't you?
What do you mean, copy?
Well, you've seen another poem where somebody did that with Dave, so you do it with Kevin.
Trevor, why do you
Trevor,
have to diminish everything?
Like it's diminishing. The way people get addicted to drugs. Yeah, you see another poem about Dave. You write a poem about Kevin.
Yeah, seen it a
before you
times.
Know it, you've written a haiku on your arm with a compass. Come on, Trev. It actually spells Kevin. I don't know why I remember it, probably because it rhymes. It didn't work. He didn't want to be my boyfriend. But years later, when we left school, in my yearbook, he wrote, I'll always feel that an opportunity.